Ahead on Sports Deck, the LA Kings douse the Flames in game one of a Smythe Division matchup. The Canadians lose a heated battle against the Nordiques. Canadian Paul Tracy comes up big in Long Beach, California. Ken helps the Expos over the hill past the Rockies. And Canada trips up Honduras in World Cup qualifying.
Sports Desk brought to you by Pontiac, General Motors performance-oriented car division. And by Right Guard antiperspirant. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Reto. Nice to have you here. Well, this is it. The 1992-93 NHL playoffs are underway. Overtime in Quebec and Boston. The Penguins flying high at the Igloo. Lots of great hockey to tell you of. First up, the Flames and the Kings. They open their Smythe Division semifinal at the Saddle Dome. Calgary hasn't won a playoff series since they won it all back in 89. Eager to end that streak. Meanwhile, Barry Melrose and the Kings anxious to shed their reputation as a one-dimensional team. Everyone knows they can score, but can they protect their own zone? Well, early in this game, they prove once again they can indeed score. Wayne Gretzky goes to work from behind the net. Just 16 seconds in, Daryl Sador puts it in. And the LA Kings quiet the Saddle Dome crowd, 1-0 lead. It's a rough one. Corey Millen, high stick, and Kevin Dahl. Then Theo Fleury comes in and decks Millen. After a short time later, Alexis Zibnik catches Al MacInnis. Big hip check, knocks him flying. Second period now, the Flames tie it up. Great solo effort there by Gary Suter. Goes to the backhand, beats Kelly Rudy. And the game's all tied at one. 25 seconds later, Jimmy Carson pulls the puck out of a crowd and slides it by Mike Vernon. Gives the Kings the lead again, 2-1. And just 24 seconds later, Dave Taylor to Charlie Huddy. Charlie Huddy, highest slot, beats Vernon, 3-1 Kings. One down note for the LA Kings. Wayne Gretzky left the game with a Charlie horse. He is day to day. On to the third period now. Only up 5-1, but the Flames come back. Joel Otto, nice pass. Chris Dahlquist puts it in, 5-2 for the Kings. Then Trent Yanni moves in, face-off circle, unwinds and lets it go just inside the post. 5-3, Flames trailing. The Thomas Sandstrom will feed Carson in front. He one times it by Vernon. Bruce McNall all smiles as LA Kings go to the Saddle Dome and leave with a victory. 6-3 the final. Sador, Carson with two, Millen, Huddy, and McSorley. For Calgary, it was Suter, Dahlquist, and Trent Yanni. Peter Watts was at the game and has this post-game report for us.
Aggression with discipline, the storyline of game one. The Kings had it, the Flames didn't. Guess which team is leading in this series?
We're a hard team to play against. We play very hard, we play very physical. We're not big, but we've got a lot of courage, and we go to the net very hard, and those things cause big men a lot of problems.
For the 5-3 hockey game with 11, 12 minutes left, we really had to be disciplined. I think it's easier, too, to be a disciplined hockey team when you jump out and get a lead. They had to be the aggressors, and they had to come at us. They had to maybe open it up a little bit, and when they're coming at you like that, you can, you know, feed the puck up to your forwards, but you really, you're in control of the hockey game.
How serious is the injury to Wayne?
We feel he'll be ready to play Wednesday. It's a day-to-day, but it's coming good, and we don't think there'll be any problems.
Well, I'd say you get back on your heels pretty good when they score in the first shift, yep. We got right back on our heels, and that's not the way to start off a game this important.
And the bottom line is we killed ourselves tonight. Penalties, you know, I think we gave them 4 or 5 on threes. And you do that to a team like LA with all their firepower, they're going to hurt you, and they did tonight.
The only significant injury he suffered in the game was to Wayne Gretzky. It's a Charlie horse. It's a day-to-day problem, but he'll probably be ready for Wednesday. And defense may be back in the lineup as well. He missed game one because of back problems. So the Kings in the driver's seat in this series, leading 1-0. The Flames with a lot of work to do to turn up their game if they hope to get a split here in the series. Peter Watts, TSN, in Calgary.
Thanks, Peter. Next up, the Battle of Quebec, the Canadians and the Nordiques. What a turnaround for Quebec. Dead last in 3 of the last 4 NHL years. And now, last season, the only team worse than them last season, of course, the San Jose Sharks. But thanks in large part to the Eric Lindros follow-up, the Nordiques finished 4th overall this season. And for the first time in a very long while, they can justifiably be favored going into a playoff series against their provincial rivals, the Montreal Canadiens. Pierre Pagliaro's got his work cut out with him. A lot of inexperienced young talent on that team. Gilbert Dion takes advantage of the inexperience early on, gets by the defenders, then beats Ronnie Hextall, gives Montreal a 1-0 lead. Canadiens know Patrick Roy's got to come through big, and he does early on. Joey Sakic breaks in all alone. Backhand stop, the rebound stopped as well. Nordique catch a break. Ronnie Hextall gives up the big rebound, but John LeClair misses the wide open net. Second period, Canadiens go up by a pair. Brian Bellows blasts it, beating Hextall. 2-0 Montreal. Patrick Roy continues to shine. Matt Sundin to Lecition, back to Sundin, and Sundin is stopped by Roy on the goal line. Hextall comes up big again. Brian Bellows with the shot from in close, and Hextall stops him. A few minutes later, now, minute and a half to go. Hextall on the bench, Claude LaPointe to Martin Rosinski. Rosinski scores. Quebec, the 6-on-4 advantage, Montreal at the penalty, 2-1 trailing. Now, dying seconds of the game. Sakic, the shot, beats Roy. 47.3 seconds left. It's all tied up at 2. We go to overtime. Jacques Demers is very upset with the penalty to Gilbert Dion that gave Quebec the 6-on-4 advantage. In overtime now, just over 3 minutes left. Scott Young breaks in, wraparound, beating Patrick Roy. And with that, the Nordiques come back from a 2-0 deficit to hand Montreal a 3-2 overtime loss. Dion and Bellows from Montreal for Quebec. It was Rosinski, Sakic, and Scott Young, the winner in overtime. Scott Young, a day he will not soon forget.
I think it's very important that, you know, for us to win the way we did tonight is important for us in the rest of the playoffs. I think it'll help us. It's a confidence booster, and it's also, when we're in another game and we might go down by a goal or two, we'll know that, hey, we can come back. We'll be confident enough to not quit and come back.
Just kept plugging away. We knew in the third period that they were going to play tight, and they did that, and we just had to work for everything we got. We got a key power play there, got a power play goal, and just the adrenaline kept us going.
These things are going to happen, but we still have to keep our focus and forget about this one, because that's how it goes in the playoff. You play, you forget, you play, you forget. So we'll try to forget this one as soon as possible and try to beat them next game.
Montreal played a hell of a game, and you know, we came out on top today, and we got to make sure that I think we'll be a lot looser next game, and hopefully we can start off a lot better and bury some of the chances that we had.
Knocked away to the other Adams Division semifinal, Boston and Buffalo. First period action. Andy Moog with a bad giveaway. Dave Hannon converts with it. It's 1-0 Buffalo. Bruins go up by 2. Alexander McGillie with a bad angle shot. Patrick Fontaine with a deflection, and it's 2-0 Buffalo at the Boston Garden. Second period action. Cam Neely will get things going. Let the shot go. Joe Juno redirects it in past Grand Fuhr. A power play goal, 2-1, Bruins trailing. Bruins tie the game at 2. Adam Oates goes to Cam Neely. The puck goes off Neely while he's falling into the net. Game is tied at 2. Third period now. Ray Bourque with the terrible giveaway. Doesn't happen a lot, but he pays for it here. McGillie intercepts, beats Moog with the blast, 4-2. Sabres leading. Less than 5 minutes left to go in the game. Bruins down by a pair of goals. Adam Oates goes to Joe Juno. He passes to Cam Neely. 4-3 for the Sabres. Then the Bruins tie the game at 4. Joe Juno gets his fourth point of the night. Great pass to Steve Heinz. Heinz converts, and the game is tied at 4. Overtime loom. And in overtime, an ex-Bruin does the damage against his former teammates. Bob Sweeney, the slap shot pass Moog. Surprise, surprise, the Sabres defeat the Bruins at the Boston Garden 5-4. It was Hannon, LaFontaine, McGillie with a pair, and Sweeney for Buffalo. For Boston, it was Joey Juno, Neely with a pair, and Steve Heinz. All right, time for a break, but when we come back, we'll continue with the Stanley Cup playoff picture, including highlights from a very noisy Chicago stadium. And the most predictable series of all, the Pittsburgh Penguins against the New Jersey Devils. Can the Devils stop Mario Lemieux? Not likely.
A noble warrior once advised, be vigilant against one's unfragrant perspiration. My ritual is right guard sports deck for unyielding wetness protection. The best defense is not to offend. Right guard sports deck. Anything less would be uncivilized.
The lines in this car are very clean. Very aerodynamic. I thought you were going to give me a nice car to drive. I didn't think you were going to give me something that could perform. I like it. Very nice. Somebody's put some engineering into this car. I might just walk out of here with it.
A noble warrior once advised, against one's unfragrant perspiration. My ritual is right guard sports deck for unyielding wetness protection. The best defense is not to offend. Right guard sports deck. Anything less would be uncivilized.
To the Patrick Division now. The Penguins open at the Igloo against the Devils. Pittsburgh was a win away from tying an NHL playoff record. They won 11 postseason games in a row last year, including sweeps in the Stanley Cup semifinal and, of course, the final as well. And there's no reason to believe the New Jersey Devils will pose much of a threat to end that streak this season either. Fans at the Igloo ready for their drive to their third straight NHL title. Devils know they have to stop for this man, Mario Lemieux, to have any chance at all. But the concerns cost them early. Dave Barr high sticks Lemieux in the face. Pens have the early power play. Lemieux is fine. With the extra man, Lemieux goes to Stevens. His shot is wide, but Rick Tocchet is there to tuck it in. Pittsburgh leads 1-0. Then with the game tied at 1, watch this. Great play by Yager. Beats the defender. Pass to Lemieux. Lemieux converts. Pens lead 2-1. They are out. Standing together. Chris Terreri saw the fight, the deficit. Stevens on the breakaway, but is turned away. Second period, Stevens with a great blind pass, and Lemieux fires it home right there, beating Terreri, who was left alone. 3-1 for the Penguins. No chance for Terreri. Nicky Porter on, leading 4-1. Yager threads the needle as he feeds Dave Tippett, who puts it into the net. The Penguins in complete control, 5-1 lead. Third period now. Shel Samuelson going behind, puts it out in front. No one picks up Yager. Imagine leaving Yager open. 6-1 Penguins. Late in the third, Pens up 6-2. Scott Stevens with a blast from the point. He will beat Barrasso. Second of the game. The Pens draw some first blood, and they go on to win this one 6-3 as they draw first blood in this Patrick Division semifinal. Barton Stevens with a pair for New Jersey. For Pittsburgh, it was Lemieux with two. Tocchet, Francis Tippett, and Jaromir Jagr. The Penguins win their 12th straight playoff game that ties an NHL record. Elsewhere in the Patrick Division, Al Arbor and the Islanders facing the Washington Capitals at the Cap Center. First period action. Ray Ferraro in alone, fakes the backhand, then goes to the forehand, beats Rick Trabaracci, and it's 1-0 for the Islanders. Meanwhile, Glenn Healy shuts the door on the Caps in the early going. Kristich in close is stoned by bad. Second period, Terry Murray still looking for ways to solve Healy. Al Arbor bouldering in, blasts it. Healy stops it and gets knocked back into his own net. Then Kevin Hatcher in close, stopped by Healy as well. They continue to try to jam it in. Healy makes a couple of stops, lying on the ice, but keeps the puck out of the net. Third period, the Caps finally get a break. Loose puck in the crease. Pat Elenuk can't score. Dale Hunter is there, jams it in. Everyone's in the crease. They say the goal does stand, ties the game at 1. Then Glenn Healy, big mistake, tries to clear the puck, gets it to Dale Hunter instead. It's 2-1 for the Caps. Things getting a little rough. Brad Delgarno nails Ray Ferraro into the glass, almost into your living room. Then Al Iafredi comes in and nails Delgarno to give him a little bit of support for his teammate. Ray Ferraro, the only goal for the Islanders for the Caps. It was Hunter with two, and Kristich's first of the playoffs as well. Rick Tabaracci made 22 stops in this game. The Capitals take a 1-0 series lead with a victory at the Cap Center. To the Smythe Division now, the Hawks and the Blues. Game one, the North Division rather. Game one, Chicago Stadium. The Blues ended the season 26 points behind the Hawks, but head even. The only edge Chicago has earned is home ice advantage, and that only lasts until you lose your first game at home. A little foreshadowing? Yeah. Bob Berry looking a little nervous. The Chicago Stadium can understand why. The story early on is all Chicago, especially Brian Noonan. Hawks up early. Steve Larmer along the boards will shoot. Brian Noonan in front will tip it in. Noonan, his first goal of the game, 1-0 Hawks. Then St. Louis with a scoring opportunity. Rod Sutter in all alone. Save Belfour. Then the Hawks turn it around. Jeremy Roenick on the rush. Cross ice pass. Brian Noonan fires it by Joseph right here, and it is 2-1. Bob Berry not happy about that play at all. Chicago will add another. Stephane Matteau will fire it at the net. Brian Noonan in front redirects it. The hat trick for Brian Noonan. Brian Noonan 3, St. Louis 1. Bob Berry trying to fire up his teammate, his team. Blues trying to get back into the game. Third period action, 3-2 Blues trailing. Puck comes to Jeff Brown. He feeds Brendan Shanahan. Quick shot feeds Belfour, and it's tied at 3. Now it's Daryl Sutter's turn to be a little concerned. He'll try to collect his team together again, and he fails. Nelson Emerson on the rush behind the goal, centers it. Brett Hall puts it in, 4-3. Daryl Sutter, indeed a little worried. The Hawks bounced by the Blues in game number one. That's the Chicago Stadium. That'll quiet things down just a little bit. St. Louis wins it 4-3. Brown, Belsner, Shanahan, and Hall. Goals for the Blues. For the Hawks, Brian Noonan, all three. The Blues take a 1-0 series lead. And the other Norris Division semifinal will feature the Leafs at the Detroit.
They take on the White Sox Saturday, 1:30 Eastern on Real TV, TSN. Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, Trevor pulls the trigger and grounds the Jets in Vancouver. Stevie's wondering where the Leaf defense is. The Jays had the big bats out at Cleveland. Say it ain't so. Is Joe gonna go? And you'll fall over when you see our plays of the week.
Desk is brought to you by Pontiac.
Hi, everyone, and welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. Monday night was a very light night in sports. Just a couple of baseball games, a couple of basketball games, and a couple of hockey games. Two very big hockey games, though, as two more NHL playoff series opened up. Let's get right to it, starting with the Canucks and the Winnipeg Jets. In the Smythe Division playoffs last year, the Jets blew a 3-1 series lead to the Canucks and ended up losing in seven games, and that hurt, and they remember that. But last season, the Jets did not have Teemu Selänne, the Finnish Flash. He was getting his first taste of NHL playoff hockey in this one, although against Vancouver, Selänne has hardly been a flash. 76 goals this year, only two came against Vancouver in seven meetings, and the Canucks were hoping the playoffs would stimulate their imported sniper, Pavel Bure, back to midseason form. Let's take a look at the action. Phil Housley, they said he was going to miss this game. Charlie Horse in the last regular season game, but he's out there. First period, Canucks 2-on-1. That is Greg Adams finishing it off. Trevor Linden with a nice setup. And 1-0 Canucks in a big hurry. A couple minutes later, Murray Craven. This is why they got him over from Hartford, to help out in the playoffs. 2-on-1, he decides to shoot. It trickles past Essensa. Craven makes it 2-0. Still in the first period, Thomas Steen flips the puck out in front and then follows it up and slides it past McLean. 2-1 Vancouver. This one's physical at times. That was Ty Domi hammering Robert Dirk. Also good goaltending in this one. Look at Essensa's good reaction on a deflection there. Third period, still 2-1 Canucks. Chris King tries to center it, can't center it, tries the wraparound, and it works, and it beats McLean, and the game is tied at 2. Late in the third, Jeff Cortinel takes the shot from the far side. It's stopped, but Trevor Linden allowed to walk in with the rebound, and he buries it past Essensa, 3-2 Vancouver. Jets are desperate for the tie. Stu Barnes has a great chance in front. Look at this. He just can't pull the puck out of McLean's pads in time to pop it over him. And at the other end, there is a giveaway. Jeff Cortinel to Cliff running, and he beats Essensa for the insurance goal, 4-2 for the Vancouver Canucks. And the fans go home happy. And the final score here is Vancouver 4, Winnipeg 2. And the goal scorers, Adams, Craven, Linden, Ronning, Steen, and King replying for Winnipeg. Pavel Bure with two assists. Teemu Selänne, no points in this one. Game number 2 will be Wednesday at the Pacific Coliseum. And for a post-game report on this game, let's go to David Pratt now in Vancouver.
The Canucks now lead this series 1-0, as the man who came through for them and scored the winning goal was their captain, Trevor Linden.
You know, my season started out a little slow, but I think the second half went pretty well for me, and I started to play the kind of hockey that I'm capable of. And tonight I just tried to do the little things the best I could and go out and do the best I could, basically. And I think our group's really focused this year, and it's good to see.
When it went in?
It's relief. You know, I remember how we started last year. You know, we dropped the first one and put ourselves in a hole, so it's nice to get off on the right foot.
Nobody ever said this guy was going to be the big point man for us. He was going to be the leader for us. He was going to be the guy that takes charge, the guy that sets the tone. And that has a value that doesn't measure in points. And that's what's happened here in the last little while. He stepped up and he's doing a very good job.
We just have to pick up our game, you know. I don't think we were very tenacious, strong on the puck, and I don't think we skated very well. So, you know, our overall game has room to be picked up a lot.
The other big factor in this hockey game was the Canucks' ability to shut down the Jets' Teemu Selänne, something they know they'll have to do again in game 2. David Pratt, TSN, Vancouver.
All right, thank you, David. For the past 3 seasons, springtime in Toronto provided Maple Leaf fans with a chance to see their hockey heroes on the golf course instead of on the ice. But this year, the Leafs are back in the playoffs. They're excited about it in Toronto. The series, the Norris semifinal, opened in Detroit, in the Motor City, with the Red Wings. And people say the Leafs are overmatched in this one. They'll be out in six games. Too many guns on that Red Wing team. Well, a lot of those guns were blasting away in game number one. Let's take a look at the highlights. And speaking of big guns, look at Bobby Probert running over Todd Gill right here. Setting the tone early. This one's going to be physical. Red Wings on the board first. Eiserman out front through the slot, waiting till there's a crowd in front of Felix Potvin. He scores to make it 1-0. Leafs tie the score a little bit later, though, in the first period. John Cullen will pick up a fat rebound in the slot here and have the poise to go to the backhand on Chevalier, tuck it in. 1-1 tie. Second period, power play goal. It'll be Paul Coffey to Bob Probert to Ray Shepard. Quick shot into the corner, past Potvin. 2-1 Wings, power play goal. Then a shorthanded goal by Detroit. This is Sean Burr down the left side. He tees it up and blows it by Potvin. 3-1 Red Wings. It's now 4-1 Red Wings, and Eiserman at work once again. He tries the wraparound here. That doesn't go, but it bounces to Mark Howe. The veteran snuck in from the point and popped that one in. 5-1 Detroit. And Probert still running around, nailing people. He nails Rouse there, and then he takes a run at Mironov here. Nobody does anything about Probert's physical play. The Leafs do score just before the end of the second. Doug Gilmore with 1 second left. Chevalier not concentrating there. 5-2 Detroit after two. Third period, though, Detroit continues to roll. Keith Primo feeding Yves Racine. His shot goes off Jamie McCowan and fools Potvin. And the Red Wings crush the Toronto Maple Leafs 6-3 in the opener of their Norris semifinal. Goal scorers, Eiserman, Shepard, Burr, Chiasson, Howe, and Racine. Cullen, Gilmore, and Lefebvre scoring for the Toronto Maple Leafs. The Leafs allowing 6 goals for the first time in 55 games. Game two of this series will be Wednesday night at the Joe Louis Arena. Let's hear more on game number one from TSN's Rod Smith in Detroit.
The Leafs know what they have to do to beat Detroit in this series. It's something they've done all year long. One of the keys to their success: disciplined defensive hockey that Pat Burns likes. But that's easier said than done sometimes, especially against the most prolific offense in the NHL. On this night, after a close first period, Detroit blew it wide open with the special teams. 2 power play goals, 1 shorthanded.
We can't be taking penalties like that. And, you know, they're a great offensive team, and they certainly showed it tonight. And I think we have to play a little better defensively if we're going to do something in this series. Pierce could have put us ahead, and we ended up getting the penalty, and they got a shorthand one kind of in the second period that kind of set us back. But after that, we kind of got away from a game plan, and you can't do that against a club with all the offensive weapons they have.
Just wanted to go out and play our game. I mean, we know that Felix Potvin is a great goaltender. I think that, you know, if Cliff Fletcher had in his mind to trade Grant Fuhr, I mean, they've got a lot of confidence in Potvin. He's a great goalie, and all we tried to do is just execute the way we've been doing the last 2 months. You know, get the shots, go to the net, and tonight it worked for us, but, you know, next game it might not.
As for Pat Burns' reaction, when asked if he was concerned at this point in the series, he said, "I'm not concerned about anything. It's just one game." The Burns and the Leafs and their defensive style will have a chance to prove that they can shut down Detroit's high-powered attack on Wednesday night. Rod Smith, TSN, in Detroit.
Okay, thank you, Rod. Time for a short break here on TSN Sports Desk. When we come back,
in the Stanley Cup Playoffs. Catch it today on Real TV, TSA.
Coming up on Sports Desk, the Nordiques take another run at the Montreal Canadiens. Super Mario and the Penguins ring up another Stanley Cup record. The Islanders and the Capitals put in a little OT. The world champions run into an iron solid Team Canada. And Joe Montana is finally a Chief.
Desk is brought to you by Right Guard Antiperspirant. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Hi, everyone. I'm Brendan Connor, welcoming you again to TSN Sports Desk. We sure had a wild hockey game on Tuesday night here on TSN. We'll have highlights of that and more for you over the next 30 minutes or so. And we'll also preview the series, which will go to game number two on Wednesday night. But first, let's look at the second games in the Adams and Patrick Division playoffs.
Montreal Canadiens and Quebec Nordiques were back at it at the Colisée on Tuesday in Quebec City. Game one was a thriller. It saw the Habs blow a late 2-0 lead and lose it in overtime. Montreal needed a quick start against the Nords in game two to tie this series, but it was the Nords who really blasted off the blocks in this one. Patrick Roy, the victim of the late problems last game, back in net in this one. Heated rivalry early on. Look at Benoit Brunet take Steve Duchesne into the boards and through the open gate. Habs threatened here. Paul DiPietro is in alone on the veteran Hextall, and Hextall kicks the pad out. Big save there. The Nords strike first on the power play. Kamensky drops. Lucicien takes it. Top of the slot. Scores. And it's 1-0 for Quebec. Still in the first, it's game one, Tyrrell. Scott Young over the blue line, lets it go. How Patrick Roy missed this one with the glove, we're not sure. 2-0 Nord. Patrick Roy not sharp here either. Bounces off the boards once again. Scott Young steps in, slaps it past Patrick Roy. His second of the game, 3-0 Nord. Stefan LeBeau heads up. This is the playoffs. Craig Willanen almost takes his head off there. Second period, still 3-0. Guy Carboneau with the shot here. Look at the glove save by Hextall. Doesn't hang on, but keeps the Habs off the board. They eventually solve Hextall. Bellows dekes him and scores from a bad angle. 3-1 Quebec, but Quebec adds an empty netter late, and they really put the squeeze, the crunch on the Montreal Canadiens in this one. 4-1, the final score for Quebec, so they jump out to a 2-0 series lead. Scott Young with a pair, Lucicien and Claude Lapointe with the singles for Quebec. Brian Bellows for Montreal. Ron Hextall very solid with 32 saves, and TSN's Michael Whalen has this report.
The Montreal Canadiens got off to a quick start but were subdued by the Nordiques with three early goals in the first period, including two from the so-called checking line of Scott Young, Claude Lapointe, and Mike Ricci. From that point on, the Nordiques did a very effective job of shutting down the Canadiens' offense.
Montreal plays so good with the lead that one of our main goals is to get out there and get a lead and try to pull them out of their defensive style.
Scott Young and I, we got some great speed, and Mike Ricci just playing defensively. He stays high, and we go to the corner and get the loose pucks, and I think we drive to the net. We go to the net for the rebounds. I think that's our success right now.
As a team, we got to be a lot more hungrier. We got to realize it's the playoffs. I mean, you got to push yourself to the limit, and I think as a team, we can be a little bit more aggressive in smart ways, but we just got to have that hunger.
They had some chances tonight, and they're a great team, but I think we limited the amount they had. I thought we played very well defensively. I thought at the end, the last 5 minutes or so, we played very well. You know, you know a team's going to press when you're down late in the game, and I thought we kept our composure very well.
I was expecting that. I knew that they were going to come really hard, I was just hoping to make the big saves and keep the guys in the game, you know, and it didn't happen. It was 3-0.
And so the scene now shifts upriver to the Montreal Forum, where unfortunately the Canadiens did not have good luck against the Nordiques in the regular season, losing three straight games. Michael Whalen, TSN at the Colisée in Quebec City.
Okay, on to the other Adams Division duel, and Grant Fuhr was very good in game number one, giving the Buffalo Sabres a one-game lead. He's also sharp in this one, too, and the Sabres start the goal scoring as Wayne Pressly rips one past Andy Moog there, 1-0 Buffalo. Fuhr continues to shine. Steve Leach, quick shot, and Grant Fuhr, quick pad. Still in the first power play, Bill Holder's shot will be tipped by Randy Wood, side of the net. Here's Holder at the point. There's Randy Wood in front. Tip in past Andy Moog. Sabres up 2-0 in Boston. They already lead the series. Boston tries to get one before the end of the first. Dave Shaw, again, turned away by a quick toe save by Grant Fuhr right there. Second period, Pat LaFontaine with a great bank pass off the boards to send McGillney in alone. McGillney full stride, and he just delivers it right between the legs on Andy Moog, 3-0 for the Sabres. Brian Sutter gives Moog the hook after that. Rookie John Blue in there. The story continued to be, though, at the other end. Boston pressing. Glenn Wesley's shot stopped, and Cam Neely robbed by Fuhr lying on his back. Playoff performer from a long time ago. Grant Fuhr and the Sabres take a two-game lead, beating the Bruins again in Boston. 4-0 the score. 34 saves for Grant Fuhr. Goal scorers Wood, Pressly, McGillney, and Dale Hawerchuk. The Sabres have never beaten Boston in a playoff series. Five times they've met, and they have never managed to beat them. Meanwhile, short of kidnapping, nobody has really figured out a way to stop Mario Lemieux. He's been playing the best hockey of his career and has become far and away the dominant player in the NHL, possibly in the world. And even if the New Jersey Devils can hold Lemieux to a goal or two, they still have to contend with a powerhouse supporting cast, as the Devils discovered in Game 2 of their Patrick Division semifinal. Let's go to Pittsburgh for these highlights, and the fans hoping that the Pittsburgh goaltender, Tommy Barrasso, would have a big game. He gets off from the offense early. Ron Francis to rookie Sean McEachern, fights off the defender, tips it past Terreri, 1-0 Pens. Devils on the power play next, but old Samuelson slaps it off the boards, and look who goes in alone, gobbles it up at center ice, fights off Bruce Driver, goes to the backhand, goes upstairs. A terrific goal by Mario, 2-0 Pittsburgh after one. Second period, Rick Tocchet with a great move right there on Fetisov, loses Fetisov, flips it over Terreri, 3-0 Pittsburgh. Tom Barrasso at the other end, very strong. Watch this save on Scott Stevens, who blasts it from point-blank range, but Barrasso stopped it. More offense from Pittsburgh at the other end. Jaromir Jagr out of the corner, top of the circle, zing. Terreri gets a piece, but then knocks it over his shoulder and in. 4-0 Pittsburgh. Barrasso stays strong. Meantime, in the Pittsburgh end, here he makes a terrific save off Stefan Richie. Just stays with Richie. Later, 5-0 Penguins. And Jeff Daniels on a 2-on-1. Again, this rookie McEachern fights off a defender and pokes the puck past Terreri. 6-0 Penguins. They go on to win this one 7-0. Jagr, Tocchet, Kevin Stevens, Joe Mullen, McEachern with two, and Mario Lemieux with a goal. That was Lemieux's only point. Ron Francis had three assists. So the Penguins set a new NHL record with 13 straight playoff wins, dating back to last season as well. Barrasso, 36 saves for the shutout. Okay, on to Landover now for the Islanders and the Caps. Al Arbor, knowing his team, faces that close, tough battle in this one. Tabarachi strong in goal for Washington early, Flatley to Hogue, and Tabarachi slides across for a great save. Third period, game tied at three, Flatley takes the shot, Ray Ferraro with the rebound, again, fighting off a defenseman to chip it in over Tabarachi, Isles up 4-3. Time running out in the third, and the Caps trying to tie. Dale Hunter sweeps it around Glenn Healy, and Hunter's third of the game makes it 4-4. That was 2 seconds left in the game, and Hunter sends it to overtime. In overtime, Steve Thomas with a great chance. Tabarachi, though, will reach into the net. There's Thomas firing. It's in the air behind the goal line. Tabarachi reaches in and grabs it. No goal. Down at the other end, Dale Hunter with a terrific chance, but look at the save by Healy. Robs them blind. They crash the net, but no goal. Some huge hitting here. Kasparaitis and Todd Krieger. Krieger going into the board. In the second overtime, yeah, this goes to double overtime. Brian Mullen drives the net. The puck is on the pad of Tabarachi, on the pants, and he turns around and kind of sweeps it with his glove and sweeps it into his own net. And the chicken crows for nothing as the Islanders, on that disputed goal, win it 5-4 in double OT. Pierre Turgeon with a pair, Benoit Hogue, Ray Ferraro, and Brian Mullen with the winner in overtime. Dale Hunter had three for the Caps, five already in the playoffs. Kristich had the other one, and the series is now tied at 1-1. Oh, that was a great game.
Live Sunday morning, April 25th, 7:50 Eastern, right here on Real TV, TSN.
Sports Desk. Burry and the Canucks hope to bury the Winnipeg Jets. Jack Morris looks for win number one against Kansas City. The Expos try to make the Dodgers blue. Sorry, says Joe, but I've got to go. And we'll look ahead to game number three in the Habs Quebec Nordiques NHL playoff series.
Sports Desk. Brought to you by Makita Canada Incorporated, Canada's leading manufacturer of professional power tools. And by Western Union, the fastest way to send money.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to another edition of TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. Busy Wednesday in sports, busy time of the year, of course, in sports. Baseball season's in full swing. The NBA regular season is winding up. First, though, we're going to take a look at what went on in the Stanley Cup playoffs as the Campbell Conference action went on Tuesday night. Every team has a book on the opposition on any given night, and the book on the Winnipeg Jets, obviously, is to try to stop Teemu Selänne, and you'll likely stop the Winnipeg Jets. Gary Vaulk of Vancouver did the job in Game 1, holding Solani to just one shot on goal. The Jets promised things would be different, though, in game number two. Let's take it to Pacific Coliseum in Vancouver. Pat Quinn trying to go up a couple of games here. His team does score first. Cliff Ronning gets the second shot of the series, second goal of the series, top corner right there, spinning and firing. Essence of no chance, 1-0 for Vancouver. Second period action, though. Teemu Selänne, a pretty good scoring chance coming up. And Kirk McLean will rise to the occasion. Selänne from Zamnov. Back of the pads there by McLean. Nice stop. Still 1-0 for the Canucks. They go in front by two. Sergei Boughton with the giveaway right there. Jeff Cortnell, Johnny, on the spot, and he slips it past Essence. 2-0 Vancouver. The Jets do score, though. Ty Domi down in the corner. Bad angle shot. Somehow that gets in. Beats McLean, an unlikely playoff scorer. Ty Domi, 2-1 Jets trail after two. Third period, 30 seconds in. Housley to Teppo Numminen. He walks in and blows one by. Kirk McLean ties the game at two. Keith Tkachuk, though, worried late in the game. The Canucks are threatening. Pavel Bure will finally get his first goal of the series, slipping the puck up, backhanding it as he falls down. Pavel Bure, winner, as the Canucks win game number two in this series. The score, 3-2. Ronning with his second, Cortnell with his first, and Pavel Bure with his first. Numminen and Ty Domi scoring for Winnipeg. So the Canucks are up 2-0. TSN's David Pratt has more from Vancouver.
For the second straight time, the Canucks have defeated the Jets on home ice in dramatic fashion. And as a result, they now lead this series 2-0.
Yeah, it was a great pass from Greg Adams. So when I got a puck, I took a pass, and the goalie was flight away from me, and I put it in.
It's a big, big victory for us, and certainly one that our guys worked hard for.
I think we played a little bit more smarter, and we wanted more to prove that we can play well. And I think we played pretty good, but not good enough. We had our own chance to win this game, but Vancouver, they have a really good team. But we don't have to be worried about it. We played a really good game, and a little bit more lucky next Friday. Beat this team.
It is only the second time in Canuck history that this team has been able to win the first two games of a playoff series. And as a result, the Canucks now head to Winnipeg in complete control of this semifinal series. David Pratt, TSN, Vancouver.
All right, thank you, David. In game one of the other Smythe Division semifinal, Calgary Flames a bit too cavalier with their puck in their own end. L.A. stole one at the Saddle Dome in game one. In game two, of course, the Flames were looking to tighten things up in their own end and tighten up the series at a game apiece. Let's go to the Saddle Dome and see how this one went. Early on, second period, it is 1-0 Kings, and Gary Roberts behind his back to Joel Otto. Lovely setup, and that ties it at one. Late second period, Al McGinnis all alone in front, but a great save by Kelly Rudy. Still 1-1. Minutes later, Rudy not that lucky. Trent Yanni with a rick shot from the point somehow gets through. 2-1 Flames. Still in the second. 3-1 Calgary. Joe Nieuwendyk cuts in on net and is able to put it upstairs with a good wrist just before he falls down. 4-1 Flames. And with time winding down in the second, Joel Otto will get away on a breakaway. And he makes a great dig of that big reach. 6'4", and he puts it past Rudy and makes it 5-1. Could use some Tylenol right there. Bound to have a headache after this one. Got worse. Third period, Robert Reichel tries to feed Nieuwendyk. Goes in off McSorley. 6-2 Flames. Later in the third, it's 7-2 Flames. Al McGinnis with a shot from the point. Theron Fleury will tip it in right there. Cruising in front of Rudy, and that made it 8-2. And the Flames go on to pace Los Angeles 9-4 in game number two. That evens up the series. Joel Otto with a pair. Robert Reichel with a pair. Singles from Yanni, Nieuwendyk, Kozlowski, Suter, and Theron Fleury. Jimmy Carson had a pair for L.A., Warren Reichel, and Yari Curry with the singles. The Flames have lost the first game in the playoffs 6 times in the past 11 years, and they have a 1-5 record in those series, but they are back even now with Los Angeles, and TSN's Peter Watts has more in this report.
Momentum is everything in the playoffs. It wasn't pretty, but the Flames managed to regain it here on home ice, salvaging a split in the first two games of their series with the Kings.
Any win in playoffs is a huge win, and we felt confident. We've been a good road club all season, and LA is pretty good at home, so I see a good battle down there. I see us coming together, hopefully as a team, a little bit better, and tonight was a good example of where we played better than we did the first game.
Tonight was just the result of a lot of hard work by a lot of players that maybe didn't get any credit for the goal, but they were going to the net, and I think that he was more aware of them coming to the net than maybe playing the puck, and it found its way through the net.
I like the way the guys didn't get involved in the pushing and shoving and just seemed to keep their focus on trying to play a good game and play a disciplined game. And the reinforcement on the bench from other players was excellent. When a guy came in and did show some discipline, he was rewarded by his teammates right away on the bench. A lot of talk.
You know, when you get that first game, your idea is to go out and get the second game. But I guess if you said at the start when we came in here, if we went away with a split, I guess you'd be happy. But like you say, we're a little disappointed because we get up that first game and we had a chance to, you know, to do a little damage. And it just didn't happen tonight. And hopefully we go back to LA and get the first one back there.
The chippiness of the last 4 or 5 minutes of the third period means the emotions are heating up on both sides. This series is a long way from being over as the scene shifts to Los Angeles for Game 3 on Friday. Peter Watts, TSN, in Calgary.
Okay, so that takes care of the Smythe Division. We'll take a short break here on TSN Sports Desk, and when we come back, we'll take you to noisy Chicago Stadium, where the Blues and the Blackhawks are playing Game 2 of their Norris Division semifinal, and where the Blues were out to shock the Blackhawks once again in Chicago. We'll see. And we'll also go to Joe Louis Arena, where the Maple Leafs were looking to bounce back after getting bounced around in Game 1.
When Makita builds high-quality power tools, they design them for the real world, where your reputation is only as good as your last job, where performance and reliability is what pays the bills, where there's just no room for compromise, and where the right power tool for the job is worth everything. That's why the one name that rises to the top is Makita, the power you can trust. For a limited time, buy this variable two-speed drill and get this amazing bonus value pack, including a drill bit set, insert bit set, and extra battery.
Today, or your father and I could be washed away.
When you need to send money to someone fast, come to Western Union. We'll make sure it gets to any of our over 19,000 locations across Canada, the U.S., or worldwide in minutes.
I'm calling about your son, Grover. You better send money. His ski trip's over.
Western Union, the fastest way to send money. Available at Money Mart and other fine locations across Canada.
Welcome back to Sports Desk, everyone. The Toronto Maple Leafs really got pushed around in Game 1 of their Norris playoff against the Red Wings. And in Game 2 in Detroit, the Leafs were looking to win a game and win back some respect. They were ready to play tougher, but they had difficulty doing that and avoiding foolish penalties. Let's go to Joe Louis Arena, and we'll show you exactly what happened. The Leafs did promise to play a little tougher, and Jamie McCowan pounds Sean Burr into the boards to start it off. Felix Potvin had to be sharp early. Look at the stops. One, two, and the third one on Eisenbart. No score early. Later on, Potvin called on once again for a huge save on Fedorov there. Now, team captain Wendell Clark should be leading the way, but he takes some dumb penalties, like this one, a punch to Shepherd. And with the Red Wings on the power play, they will click. Iserman spots Nicholas Lidstrom sneaking in from the point over there. A bang-bang play, and it's 1-0 Wings. Early in the second period, the Wings are shorthanded, and Fedorov on the two-on-one keeps and goes to the top corner on Potvin. 2-0 Detroit. Peter Zezel, another costly penalty for the Leafs. Cross-checks Lidstrom in the face right there. Red Wings go on the power play, and they score again. Eiserman this time takes the blast, and Cicerelli was in front of Potvin. He saw nothing. 3-0 Detroit. Another nice goal. Paul Coffey, look at these wheels coming in on a two-on-one. Lovely pass over to Eiserman. He buries it, and it's 4-0. Third period, 4-1 Wings. Glenn Anderson emulates his old buddy Coffey with a nice setup for Doug Gilmore. 4-2 game. Could the Leafs be back into it? No, the Red Wings come right back. Dmitry Mironov with a brutal giveaway. That results in two shots for Eisenbart. Second one goes in over the glove of Potvin. 5-2 Wings. Late in the game, things get rough. Potvin and Dino Cicerelli and the defenseman all shoving. And look out, here comes Probert. Whoa! Game 3 should be interesting, but the Leafs are down 2-0. Nicholas Lidstrom, Sergei Fedorov, Eiserman with a pair. Eisenbart and Dallas Drake did Detroit scoring. Doug Gilmore and Dmitry Mironov for Toronto. What's Toronto going to do to regroup? Let's find out. TSN's Rod Smith is in Detroit.
Aside from a difference in the score and a lot more chippiness, Game 2 was a carbon copy of Game 1 here at Joe Louis Arena. Thanks to the goaltending of Felix Potvin, Toronto managed to stay close after one period, but then in the second, same old story, special teams. Detroit got a shorthanded goal and then another power play goal. From there, they never looked back.
I hope it continues on to something the same vein where both teams go at each other and I don't know that it'll be defensive, but I think the goals against or goals for, whatever it may be, will come down some.
Both clubs
think a lot of frustration, a lot of things were said. Frustrations came out, you know, in the first part of our game. I think I can count two undisciplined penalties that we took at the start of the game. Now, Felix Podvin throwing, trying to clear a puck, going over the boards, I don't call that undisciplined. I mean, see, that's what I call luck. And they scored again on a shorthanded goal and a bad bounce at the boards over Dave Ellett, and that just put us right out of it.
We lost two in Detroit, and we're going back in Toronto and hopefully bounce back there. Some team did it before, and we're going to give it a shot.
I think even game three is going to be more aggressive than probably game two. You know, they're going to come out and be physical and even more physical dump it in, especially in the first 5-10 minutes. I think you can sort of maybe expect a little bit, like when you go to Chicago Stadium, you know, they come out like a buzzsaw and really forecheck and try to get a few bangs and try to get the crowd into the game. So, our work's going to be cut out for us. They're going to feel pretty comfortable going back in their own building. And then, you know, we're up to which we're supposed to be. So, now it goes to their building. And, we felt confident playing in here. So I'm sure they're going to do the same in their own building.
We've been fortunate to get up in both games. And we don't really want to, you know, give them that opportunity to get back in the game and give them life in the game. So,
as happy as the Red Wings are to be up 2-0, they must be even more satisfied by the way they're winning. They are dominating the Leafs in every facet of the game but goaltending. The series shifts to Toronto for Game 3, where the Leafs are hoping a change of venue can change the momentum. Rod Smith, TSN, in Detroit.
All right, thank you, Rod. The other series, the Chicago Blackhawks, one team you don't want to be trailing in the third period. They're a solid team, especially in the playoffs and especially in their building. But in Game 1 of the Norris semifinal, St. Louis came from behind with 2 goals in 30 seconds and won that game. Could they do it again in Game number 2? Let's see as we go to Chicago Stadium for the action. First period, Jeff Brown fakes the shot from the point. Brett Hull lets the quick shot go. Power play goal, and the Blues lead 1-0. Still in the period, Jeremy Roenick with a big hit on Lee Norwood there, runs him into the glass and moves the glass. Curtis Joseph in goal for St. Louis. Great glove save there on Lemieux. He was the story of this game. The Hawks off the score sheet. Chicago on the power play. Chelios tops it up. Great move by Dave Lowry to steal it and put in the backhand and give St. Louis a 2-0 lead. Second period, scary moment for the Hawks. Denny Felsner sticks out his knee on Chelios. He was shaken up but stayed in the game. Later in the period, Brian Noonan, the hero of Game 1 with 3 goals, gets a chance here, but Curtis Joseph is there all the way. Chicago still not on the board. Daryl Sutter concerned about that. Third period, once again, Noonan in front, and once again, Joseph will turn him away as Noonan spins and fires. That's one of the hardest things for a goalie, but Bob Berry must like what he sees and says, this guy's keeping us ahead. Later in the period, Christian Ruutu alone in front as the defenseman falls 2 feet away, but Curtis Joseph's got him there. 47 saves for the St. Louis goaltender, his first career playoff shutout. St. Louis wins it 2-0, and they take a 2-0 lead in that series. Surprise? Yeah. Brett Hull with his second goal of the playoffs, and Dave Lowry with his first. And again, 47 saves by Curtis Joseph, and the Blues lead by 2 games going home. And that is the hockey team.
United takes on Chelsea. Soccer Saturday, 10 a.m. Eastern on Real TV, PSA.
Coming up on Sports Desk, the Montreal Canadiens look for a little forum magic in Game 3 against Quebec. The Pittsburgh Penguins can smell a sweep against the Devils. Chris is unhittable in the Kingdom. The group that wants the NBA in Toronto gets some big money partners. And hail to the Chief, Joe Montana is in town.
Hi, Mizuno, the world of sports, manufacturer of quality footwear and sporting equipment.
Hello, everyone, and welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. Glad you're along with us. A busy half hour ahead. Baseball, the NBA, and we'd better get started on hockey pretty soon unless we want to go into overtime the way 3 of the NHL playoff games did on Thursday. A lot of people were drawing comparisons between Quebec's playoff chances and those initially given to the NFL's Dallas Cowboys in the Super Bowl. What they said was, young talent, good talent, but not enough playoff experience. The Montreal Canadiens have the experience, but they entered Game 3 at home in Montreal Thursday, down 2 games to those young Quebec Nordiques. They had the youth, the Nords did, but they gained some playoff experience in a Game 3 thriller at the Montreal Forum. and Nordiques pick it up where they left off in game two. Matt Sundin buries one right under the crossbar. A minute and a half into the game, Quebec is up 1-0. Ron Hextall very good in Quebec's goal. Kirk Muller to Brian Bellows. Quick shot, quick move into close, but Hextall is there to stop him. Second period, though, the Habs do tie it up. Vince Domfus, nice pass out here to Kirk Muller. He scores and ties the game at one. The Habs come close to taking a lead soon after. Hextall is down, the puck is loose. The Habs are crashing the crease, but they cannot put it in. No scoring in the third. This goes to overtime. The Habs all over Quebec in the OT. Benoit Brune hits the post. Then the Habs think they've won it as Stefan LeBeau will score here. But check it out. The puck goes up in the air. LeBeau spins and hacks it in out of the air. But it was called a high stick, no goal. A few minutes later, Vince Domfus spins and fires. Hextall stops it. But the rebound hits Gusarov's skate and slides in. Hextall objected. Thought Kirk Muller kicked it in, but it was his own defenseman. And the Montreal Canadiens may just be back in this series after a thrilling 2-1 overtime win at home. Kirk Muller and Vince Domfus did the scoring. Matt Sundin for Quebec. The Habs out shooting the Nords 50-35. 12 of those Montreal shots came in overtime. TSN's Michael Whalen was at the game and talked with the players afterwards, starting with Montreal's Kirk Muller.
You know, we had a win tonight, and we tried to rebound after the disallowed goal and try to forget about it, and the guys did a good job at it and kept going and kept pressing, and fortunately we got the goal we needed.
You know, we realize it's only a start, that's for sure, and we have more games to go. I don't think no one's going to get cocky or overconfident. Let's face it, two of these games have been in overtime. The other one was just a pretty tight battle too, so it's going to be a continuous battle all the way through, and you know, both teams are very, very evenly matched.
I felt really strong tonight. And I knew it would be really tough to beat. I was really confident, and you got some nights like that, you know, you feel like you're tough to beat. And if we don't win tonight, it's pretty much over. So at 2-1, everybody in the room is very excited. The confidence is back.
Well, they just threw the puck in the zone and threw it at the net a lot, and they crashed the net. And, you know, Ron can only make so many saves on rebounds. The puck was around the crease the whole time. You know, they carried the play to us most of the night.
The Canadians outshot the Nordiques 50-35, and they were much more aggressive in their forechecking than the Quebec team. And that's the situation that Pierre Paget will address to his team as they prepare for game number four. Michael Whalen, TSN in Montreal.
So Montreal wins the game. Now what about Boston and Buffalo? That may be the best story of the playoffs so far. Grant Fuhr of Buffalo came to the Sabres as perhaps the best money goaltender in the league. Going into game three against the Bruins, the Sabres had really cashed in, not only up 2-0 in the Adams Division semifinal, but coming out of Boston with those two wins. Game three at Buffalo Thursday. Would the surprises continue? Would Fuhr's good goaltending continue? John Blue in net instead of Andy Moog for Boston. Same old story early, though. Power play, Howerchuk to LaFontaine to McGillney, and they score, and the Sabres open it up with a 1-0 lead. Buffalo keeps on coming in the first. Richard Smelik, lead pass to Yuri Mylev. He goes through the backhand and flips it home past John Blue. Scores! 2-0 Buffalo. Still in the first. Boston finally gets on the board. Puck comes back to Ray Bourque. He slaps it through a crowd, and Buffalo is up 2-1. On to the third period. 2-2. Boston looks to take the lead, but Grant Fuhr stands in there and takes the rapid fire from the Bruins. The Sabres respond to their goalie's acrobatics. Game one hero Bob Sweeney on the 2-on-1. Through the legs of John Blue. 3-2 for Buffalo. But hey, the Bruins didn't quit. Oates kicks it up to Cam Neely. Neely with a good move at the blue line. And then he'll rip it by Grant Fuhr. Ties the game. Sends it into overtime. On a Sabre power play in overtime. Howerchuk gets a couple of chances from the point. There's one. Here's the next one. Yuri Mylev tips it in. And the Sabres win in overtime at home. And they've really got the Bruins on the ropes. 4-3 the final score, and yeah, they're happy in Buffalo. Alexander McGillney with his fourth in the playoffs. Amilev had a couple in that game, including the winner, Bob Sweeney the other. Ray Bourque, Brian Smolinski, and Cam Neely for Boston. The Bruins on the verge of being swept for the first time since the 1988 Cup Final, when they lost in four to the Oilers. Last time these Sabres won a playoff series was 1983. On to the Patrick now. Everybody figured the Pittsburgh Penguins would have an easy time with the Devils in round one, but the last game made the Devils look like doormats and made the Penguins look unstoppable. It was a 7-0 blowout, and Mario only had 1 point in that game. The Penguins in their multifaceted attack went to Jersey Thursday looking for a league record 14th straight playoff win and a 3-0 series lead. Let's take the action early on. A giveaway by the Penguins, and Bill Guerin has the Devils up 1-0. 1 minute into the game. Midway through the first, Sean McKechnie, the fine rookie. Martin Straka, give and go. McKechnie, quick shot. It's in, his third of the playoffs, and the game is tied at one. Second period, Scott Stevens, big open ice hit right there on Jaromir Jagr. Later in the period, Bobby Hulik from around the blue line, quick shot. Beats Barrasso, surprisingly, from that far out. Devils up 2-1. Pens down by a goal, and they take out the smelling salts for Barrasso. How'd you miss that one, Tom? That was from far away. Take a whiff and wake up. Stuff really works. 1 minute into the third, Larry Murphy to Mario Lemieux. Wide open net, beautiful setup. Score tied at two. Score up 3-2 now for Pittsburgh. Murphy from the point. It comes back to him over here, and he lets it go through a crowd. Power play goal. Penguins lead it 4-2. Time running out in the game. Devils down by a goal. And Alexander Stimac has a chance to tie it. Look at the puck bounce over from Stastny to Stimac, but it's bouncing, and he whiffs on it. Wide open net. Could have tied the game. He didn't, and Pittsburgh hangs on to win this one by a score of 4-3. Sean McKechnie, Mario Lemieux, Peter Taglianetti, and Larry Malik and Alexander Stimac from Jersey. Pittsburgh is up 3-0 and cruising. All right, on next to Long Island, where Al Arbor and the Sabres and the Islanders are coming off a big overtime win and looking to take the series lead. The Isles take a lead first on a weird play. Tabaracci out of the net to clear. Bad bounce off the glass, right to Steve Thomas. Wide open net, 1-0 Isles. The Caps will get that one back, though. Alan May has his shot stopped, but Randy Burridge is there to bang in the big fat rebound. A 1-1 tie as the Caps even it up. Second period, Caps take the lead. Mike Ridley centers to Bobby Carpenter. Bad angle on the rebound, but he slips it in past Healy. 2-1 Caps lead, and Al Arbor says, that was an awfully bad angle. How did that go in? Third period, Caps take a two-goal lead. They're in 2-on-1. Ridley, a beautiful feed to Pat Elniak. First a great move, then over to Elniak, and Elniak just has to steer it in. 3-1 for Washington at that point on Long Island. Isles trailing 3-2 now. Steve Thomas to Pierre Turgeon, who's been doing it for the Islanders all year. Over 50 goals for them, and he ties it up for them late in the game. Overtime, the comeback is completed for New York. Ray Ferraro in front here, and he pots the winner. Barrasso 4-3 for the Islanders in overtime, and they take the series lead. Steve Thomas had a pair, Turgeon had one, Ferraro with the overtime winner. Carpenter, Burridge, and Elniak for Washington. Ferraro has scored now in six straight games. Okay, time for a quick commercial break here on TSN. Later
today, 1:30 Eastern, Blue Jays baseball. Nobody plays it like real TV, TSN. The Pro Bowl in Honolulu, Hawaii, tonight, 8 Eastern, right here on Real.
Coming up on Sports Desk, a flurry of excitement for the Calgary Flames against the LA Kings. It's hats off to Teemu Selänne as he leads the Winnipeg Jets to a win. The Blue Jays run out of lighter fluid. It's an Olay night for El Presidente in Montreal. These stories and more as Sports Desk brings down the house. Everyone, and welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor with you for the next half hour as we try to get caught up on a busy Friday in sports. And let's get started right away then. Four Stanley Cup playoff games to tell you about. Let's go first to the Vancouver-Winnipeg series. After a couple of losses in Vancouver and two games where Winnipeg's Teemu Selänne was able to manage just one assist, the Winnipeg Jets were looking to break loose in game three at home in Winnipeg. What they needed was a noisy crowd and some room for the finish flash to do his operating, and they certainly got the noisy crowd early on. 15,000 people wearing white and making white noise. Jets up 1-0 early, and Gary Vaught, Timo's shadow in this game, runs him over there, gets a charging penalty. Selänne goes on the power play and makes him pay. Tees it up from the top of the circle here, sees an opening, blows it by Kirk McLean, his first playoff goal. 2-0 Jets. The Canucks answer quickly, though. Pavel Bure with a steal from Zamnoff, and he goes in and beats Bob Essens to 2-1 for the Jets. Their lead is cut to one. Just before the end of the period, Bure with an elbow on Tkachuk. That draws a penalty. Another Winnipeg power play. And 2.5 seconds left in the period. Solani lets one go. Fans on it. But that fools McLean, and it drops in behind him. 3-1 for the Jets. Two goals for Tamu. Second period. The Canucks get one back as Trevor Linden blows one by Essensa from the far wing. And 45 seconds later, still in the second period, Canucks on a power play. Linden again, a smoker inside the post on the short side. 3-3 tie. On to the third. Jets regain the lead. Luciano Borsato away on a breakaway, and he spots an opening between the legs, and McLean puts the puck in there. 4-3 Winnipeg. A few minutes later, look who's in alone. Solani upstairs. 3 on the night. First Jet ever to score a hat-trick in playoff action. 5-3 Jets. Burray added one, but it was happiness for Winnipeg and all the fans from Finland as the Winnipeg Jets won that one 5-4. Teemu Selänne with 3 goals. Back to his old form. Keith Tkachuk and Luciano Borsato had the singles. Burray and Linden with 2 apiece for Vancouver. But Winnipeg is back in the series, and TSN's Lisa Bowes was there.
Teemu Selänne was shut out on the West Coast, which prompted the Vancouver press to create a new nickname for him, the Finnish Crash. Well, Friday night in Winnipeg, the fans were treated to the return of the Flash.
Gagard, they have a really good team, and we had a little bit lucky tonight too, but sometimes you need luck, and it's nice that we got that new game in Vancouver.
Obviously, Timo had a super game, and he seems to be out of his little playoff pressures or whatever. So it was a big win for us, and it was good to see that everybody could contribute.
He's the type of guy that loves turnovers. He loves power plays. He's an opportunist. And tonight we had too many giveaways, and he outed power plays, and he took advantage of them.
Well, I think he got pretty lucky tonight. He had one that he missed a slap shot and went in, but a play like that's bound to score. And I think the toughest one is when we gave him a breakaway when it was 3-3, or actually it was 4-3 that time, and that really hurt us when he scored a nice breakaway goal.
That meant a lot to us, and they helped a lot of us, and that's something unbelievable. We really enjoyed.
You never seen a crowd like that before?
No. I was here in 89 watching playoff games, but I didn't remember that good like that. That was great.
Yeah, definitely. It was nice, especially for me, my first time I've ever experienced the whiteout, and it was a lot of fun.
A combination of crowd noise and one of the top goal scorers this season has put the Jets back in the series, and they will try to even things up at 2 games apiece Sunday night. Lisa Bowes, TSN, Winnipeg.
All right, thank you, Lisa. Now let's go on to Los Angeles for the Flames and Kings. Each team had won a game in this series, and Jeff Reese got the start. Vernon with an ankle injury. Reese doesn't look out of place. Big glove save there on Alexei Zitnik. Great stop early on. Then Reese will rob Jimmy Carson from in close. Carson waits, and Reese is over there stacking the pad. The Flames do draw first blood in this game. Good effort by Brent Ashton. Joel Otto gets a couple of whacks at it in front, puts it in. 3 playoff goals for him, 1-0 Calgary. Second period, 2-0 Flames. Neuendijk spins and finds Pozlowski at the post. Tucks it in, 3-0 Calgary. Nice setup from Neuendijk. Kings answer back. Wayne Gretzky, nice flip pass. Alexei Zitnik converts. 3-1 Calgary after 2. Third period, Theron Fleury storms in alone. Big deke on Kelly Rudy. Shorthanded goal on a big one. 4-1 Flames. The Kings try to come back. Mike Donnelly takes the pass and beats Jeff Reese to the backhand. Cut the lead to 4-2, but the Flames add an empty netter, and they beat L.A. in L.A. by a score of 5-2. Jeff Reese, one of the big stories in this game, 6-1 lifetime against the Kings. Good call by Coach Dave King. Goal scorers, Theron Fleury with a pair. Pozlowski, Joel Otto, and Joe Neuendijk. Zitnik and Mike Donnelly, the goal scorers for the LA Kings, as the Flames take the lead in that series. Meantime, the Toronto Maple Leafs were at home Friday in their series with the Red Wings, trailing 2-0. But Game 3 would see a much different Leaf team than the one that was manhandled in Motown. Once again, the emphasis from Coach Pat Burns was, change things. Be tougher, get a quick lead, or you're going to be in trouble. Well, there were some fireworks off the top as the fans were hoping for some fireworks from their team, and the team responded. Look at Doug Gilmore with a big hit on Vladimir Konstantinov early. The early aggression paid off for the Leafs. Mike Foligno hustling out of the corner with the puck here. He digs it out, brings it out front, and it ends up on Dave Andrechuk's stick, and Andrechuk with that big reach slides it under Chevalier, 1-0 Leafs. Potvin strong in net, too. Look at the stop there on Bob Probert's quick shot. Leafs look to up their lead. Doug Gilmore, good work with the puck. He dips the doodle, gets the shot away. He stopped. Andrechuk able to reach back and shovel the rebound in. Two goals for Big Dave, 2-0 Toronto, and Mike Ilitch, the Red Wings owner, got good seats, but not enjoying this one. Second period, Wings on the board. Ray Shepard with a great pass to Fedorov, and he buries it past Potvin. The Wings trail 2-1. Felix Potvin, though, the reason the Leafs remain ahead. Look at these stops. One there from the point. Another one on the rebound, and then Probert on the rebound. Bang, bang, bang. Potvin, very strong, and Pat Burns saying, give him some protection. Third period, Leafs on the power play. Gilmore out to Wendell Clark, left alone, and under a lot of criticism early on this series, and he stuffed in the winner, and the Leafs saw the Red Wings lead in half in this series as they go on to win it by a score of 4-2. Andrzejczyk with a pair, Wendell Clark and Rob Pearson with the singles, Fedorov and Chiasson for Detroit. Toronto back in the series, some people think. Felix Potvin the key, stopping 34 shots, his first NHL playoff win. And we have this report from TSN's Rod Smith.
Well, it seems rumors of their death have been greatly exaggerated. Tonight, the Toronto Maple Leafs show that they have plenty of life as they finally shut the Red Wing offensive machine right down.
Sure good. I mean, say Felix played was just phenomenal. And we worked hard, Nick, you know, there's no doubt about it. And the fans sure gave us a lift. I think that was probably the most important key to the whole game.
Well, I feel confidence tonight, and the guy played really good in front. So when I got the two-goal lead, I mean, you feel better and better. So it's easier when you get the lead than when you always trail.
Yeah, I mean, it's a whole different, as I just said, it's a whole different ballgame when you get that two-goal lead. And they're one of the best teams in the league at shutting teams' opponents down when they get that lead, and they did that again tonight.
Well, we knew it wasn't going to be easy. We knew just because we beat the Leafs by a couple of goals every game in Detroit that they weren't going to roll over and die. I mean, you know, Potvin's too good of a goalie, and they're too good of a hockey club.
No, I think we just needed to get a lead, really, to get going. I think we were much prepared tonight. It was a do-or-die situation for us. We didn't want to be down 3-0.
I thought the team played great tonight, and Felix stonewalled them, and the defense played well. And you know, everybody, Zez didn't get a lot of credit, but Zez loaded a lot of ice time tonight, and played in a couple different lines and shut guys down and made a lot of turnovers for their team. So it was a big team effort by everybody tonight.
Some vindication for the Leafs tonight, especially for their captain Wendell Clark, whose heart had been questioned by the media and fans heading into this game. Toronto will try to tie this series with Detroit Sunday night here at Maple Leaf Gardens. Rod Smith, TSN, in Toronto.
All right, thank you, Rod. Let's go on to the other Norris semifinal. It was in St. Louis. Chicago, knowing they must win, they're down two games. They came out in a physical mood. Brett Hull in on the wing. Brian Marchman gives him a little bit of a massage after that. Then it's Marchman again as he levels Craig Janney with the big elbow. The fans in St. Louis think that, of course, this is one hull of a team. Sure, they love number 16 and the rest of them. And this is a hull of a shot that he lets go here. Top of the circle. Belfour can't handle it. It trickles in, and Janney helps it in. He gets credit. 1-0 Blues. This kid was expecting a physical game, that's for sure. That's what he got to Murray Barron on Jocelyn Lemieux. Buries him into the board. Belfour tested in the second period. Jeff Brown with a big shot. It trickles past Belfour, but he stops it before it crosses the line. Belfour was not that lucky later. Kevin Miller in front to Brett Hull. Once again, Brett Hull just pokes this one in, and 2-0 Blues. And a big smile from the Golden Brett after that one. Curtis Joseph, the story at the other end, continues to stymie the Hawks. Larmer intercepts the pass, lets it rip, and a big save by Joseph right there. Eddie Belfour unhappy with the way things are going at his end. Takes exception to Nelson Emerson running into him. Belfour swinging and all kinds of problems. Emerson gets some revenge, though. Look at this nice setup from Denny Felsner. Emerson tucks it in. 3-0 for St. Louis. And Curtis Joseph continues his stellar play at the other end. Stops Larmer and hangs on. And this sign pretty much says it all. Maybe overstates it a little bit. Only God has more saves than Curtis Joseph. He gets his second consecutive playoff shutout. The Blues win it 3-0. Brett Hull with a pair. Nelson Emerson with the single. Chicago's now lost 7 straight playoff games dating back.
Going in on goal, he shoots, he scores! Let's go!
Coming up on Sports Desk, the Canadians hope to muscle their way to even terms against Quebec. This expo is much more than a hill of beans against the Giants. The Leafs hope to leave home tied with the Red Wings. A preview of Sunday's NFL college draft, and Canada's soccer team goes for a big victory in Mexico.
Hello, everyone. Glad that you could join us tonight. Teresa Hergert along with Gino Retta. Due to the length of our hockey broadcast, there is no top-ranked boxing tonight, but we do have a great show. We've got Jay Highlights. Looks like Paul Molitor is starting to come around.
Yeah, Teresa, we'll also check in around the World Hockey Championships, where Eric Lindros has truly been great so far.
Another six-point effort. We'll also check in on the NBA as they edge closer to the playoffs. But first to hockey, Gino.
Yeah, Teresa, that's where we begin. You know, the lines have been clearly drawn in the Battle of Quebec. Montreal trailing the best of seven Adams Division final 2-1. And the Nordiques headed into war for game four at the Forum without the security of Owen Nolan in uniform. Nolan out with a Charlie horse, a sore shoulder, and a sore wrist as well. If the battle got heated, the Nords were in jeopardy of being physically out-muscled in this game. And things were physical early on. Kurt Muller and Adam Foote along the glass. Muller ends up ripping Foote's helmet right off. Forward to the action now. First period, Canadians on the power play. Ron Hextall stops Kevin Holler, but Vincent Danfous is there, and it's 1-0 Montreal. The Forum crowd goes crazy, and Pierre Pagé goes a little crazy himself. But he had nothing to worry about, because a few minutes later, Scott Young, remember the overtime winner? Well, Scott Young goes to work, wrap around, turn, shoot. Confuses Patrick Roy, who was screened on the play, ties the game at one. Ron Hextall always center of attention. Vincent Danfous nails him behind the net. You know Hextall's not going to like that. Hextall gets revenge, though, stops Brian Bellows from in close. Big, big stop. Second period now. The Canadians get to Hextall. Quebec coughs up the puck in their own zone. Big mistake. Gary Lehman pounces, scores. Puts Montreal up by a score of 2-1. Patrick Roy didn't see a lot of action, but he did see Matt Sundin skate. Watch Matt Sundin hit Roy in the head. Roy is okay. Later in the second, Roy stops Mike Hoff. Then Joe Sakic is there for the rebound. Taps it inside of the net. Game's all tied up at two. To the third period now. Canadians pull ahead again. Gilbert Dion, great move from behind the net. Pulls it out in front. His backhand goes up, and Benoit Brunet, wide open cage, puts it in. That would be the decider. The Canadians celebrate. Another solid performance by Patrick Roy. Montreal hangs on to beat the Nords 3-2. Vincent Danfous, Gary Lehman, and Benoit Brunet were the goals for Montreal. For Quebec, Scott Young and Joey Sakic. Boy, Ron Hextall's seen a lot of work. The Habs have fired 87 shots at Hextall in 2 games to the Forum. He has stopped 82 of them. Quebec certainly cannot blame Ronnie Hextall. Michael Whalen's at the Forum. He'll have a report for us coming up later on the show.
After taking a 3-0 series strike for the Bruins, Buffalo credited one person for their success, goaltender Grant Fuhr. If you're in the playoffs, he is the money goalie that you want in your net. Tonight, the Sabres had a chance to wrap up this series and advance to the second round of the playoffs for the first time in 10 years, but in a twist of fate, they would have to ultimately do it without Fuhr. Brian Sutter saying, come on, boys, let's pick up the intensity. Boston responds early. Joe Junot to Adam Oates out in front. Oates pries it loose from under. Fuhr nearly pounces on it and puts Boston on the board 1-0. Later on in the first, Dave Poulin passes over to Peter Dorris. Dorris beats Fuhr from the slot. Bruins have got a 3-1 lead in this game and are looking good. Boston playing the physical game. Dave Hannon sticks Adam Oates in the face, but Oates, he mauls Hannon right back. Later on in the first, Buffalo within one makes a mistake. LaFontaine loses it right to Adam Oates. He feeds it to Leach out in front. And the Bruins are ahead 4-2. Let's go along to the second period. Dominic Hasek can goal for the Sabres. Fuhr left with a bruised shoulder. So the Sabres down 5-2 at one point, but they come back. Al McGillney from the circle beats Moog right through the legs. Sabres are now down by one. The score is 5-4. They score in the third. Dale Hawerchuk centers in front. Yuri Kimelev ties it up. 5-5. The Sabres have come back. Fans in Buffalo, they may have a chance to witness a Buffalo sweep to overtime. Pat LaFontaine stopped by Moog. Al McGillney in close. Can't get the rebound. The Sabres, though, will get another chance. LaFontaine passes while falling down. Brad May makes a move on Ray Bourque. Moog goes down. May beats him. The Sabres win in overtime. The final score, 6-5. That first round curse is dead for the Sabres as Buffalo sweeps the Bruins in round one. Scoring for Boston in a heartbreaker. Neely, Juno, Duras, Leach, and Boulin. For Buffalo, Alexander McGillney with a pair. Also scoring Hawerchuk, Audet, Kimelev, and Brad May with that overtime winner. Now, Fuhrer is out. He's got a bruised right shoulder. The next couple of days, he can take a rest. So Buffalo wins their first playoff series since 1983. You know, they beat the Canadians that year, went on to the division final to lose, ironically, to the Bruins, but not on this night.
It's really sweet for this organization because they haven't gotten by the first round of years, and I think the big thing for our hockey club was we had so many new guys that nobody knew about that, and we were just concerned with this series. But everybody played so well, and you just don't beat the Boston Bruins without getting an effort from everybody. And to do it in four straight, we had to get the effort from everyone.
So this series lopsided, one of the tightest playoff series going on between the Islanders and the Capitals. New York leading 2-1. Both their wins coming in overtime. As a matter of fact, the Islanders are an incredible 27-7 when they go to the extra frame. Tonight, Game 4, Long Island. Once again, regulation time was not enough to decide a winner, much to the chagrin of Terry Murray and his Washington Capitals. Caps on the power play, though. He's pretty happy with what he saw early on. Puck comes back to Al Iafredi. Iafredi, the shot. He goes off somebody's skate. Iafredi gets credit. 1-0 Washington. Rick Tabarachi, the story of the first period at the other end of the ice. Ray Ferraro with an opportunity. Watch the great stop there by Tabarachi. Then Travis Green splits the defenders, and again Tabarachi makes the big stop. On to the second period now. Caps with a two-man advantage. Peter Bondra, great pass. Cross ice. Mike Ridley taps it in. 2-0 Washington. They're in control. A few minutes later, Iafredi lets the big shot go from the point. Bondra called for interference on Healy. All of a sudden, it is 3-0 Capitals. Not called, rather. It stands. Al Arbor looks up, sees the scoreboard. 3-0 Washington. Islanders answer, though, on the power play of their own. Vladimir Malikov, wrist shot from the point. Finally beats Tabarachi, and the comeback has begun. 3-1 Capitals. Then Washington looks to put it away when Todd Grieger scores. But this time, interference is called. Krieger's goal waved off, no goal. Krieger goes nuts. Third period, the Islanders continue to come back. Claude Loisel chips it out in front. Travis Green tips it in. Islanders within a goal. 3-2 they trail. A few minutes later, Uwe Krug. His shot handcuffs Tabarachi. Pat Flatley is there to knock in the rebound. They tie the score. Come back from a 3-0 deficit. Tied at 3. Overtime. Second overtime. Claude Loisel hits a streaky Ray Ferraro. Score! Ray Ferraro, the overtime winner, does it for the Islanders. Come from behind victory. The Isles trail in this game 3-0. Come back to win it in overtime again. The record in OT is now 28-7. That is incredible. What also is incredible is the fact that Ray Ferraro has now 2 overtime winners for the Islanders in this series. He leads the Isles to a 3-1 series lead. Incredible. The goal scorers recap and Iafredi is 2, and Ridley with a single for the Capitals in a losing tie. For the Islanders, it was Malikov, Travis Green, Pat Flatley, and of course, Ray Ferraro has done it again.
500 Tuesday morning, 12:30 Eastern. Feel NASCAR Thunder on Real TV, TSN.
Ahead on Sports Desk. The Jets go overboard to stay alive against the Canucks. In the Norris, the Leafs clip the Wings to tie the series at 2. Canada ends with a perfect record at the World Hockey Championships. While at the World Cup soccer qualifier, Canada was in tough against Mexico. And the Expos go for their 7th straight victory.
Sports Desk, brought to you by Chevy Truck. And by Right Guard Antiperspirant. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Retta. Nice to have you here. The first week of the NHL playoffs is now complete, and for two teams, their postseason has already come to an abrupt end. More on that in a moment, but first up, Game 4, a very tight series between the Jets and the Canucks. Vancouver leading the series 2-1 going into Sunday night's action. So far, the story has been relatively simple. The Canucks' success has been directly proportional to their ability to shut down Teemu Selanne. It worked in the first two games, they won. Selanne broke open a hat trick in Game 3, they lost. And the Jet fans hoping Selanne would get things done on this night again as well. But Vancouver takes the crowd out immediately as Greg Adams beats Bob Esenza, gives Vancouver a 1-0 lead. Jets get frustrated early. Selanne with an opportunity. The door is shut by Kurt McLean. Keith Tkachuk tries to nail Cliff Ronning, misses him.
goes into the Canucks bench. A little embarrassing. On the second period now, Peter Nedved will be stopped by Bob Esenza, but then Sergio Momesso slips in the loose puck. It is 2-0 Vancouver. Midway through the period, Winnipeg gets on the board. Thomas Steen, drop pass for Kikuchuk. Beautiful blast to the far side. No chance for McLean. Cuts the lead in half. Third period action now. Jets pressing for the equalizer. Solani is stopped by McLean, and John Paddock realizes he could be in big trouble. Because a few minutes later, Dana Murr's in 2-1. Wide open net as the Jets had pulled Essence up for the extra attacker. Vancouver wins it 3-1. Vancouver takes a 3-1 lead in their series. They've got a stranglehold now. Adams, Momesso, and Murr's an all goal for Vancouver. For Winnipeg, it was Keith Tkachuk. Lisa Bowes is at the Winnipeg Arena and has this post-game report for us.
Specialty teams were not a factor in Game 4, both teams unable to convert on their power play chances. The difference in Winnipeg Sunday night, Kirk McLean.
Real sharp, you know, it seemed like his attitude was good all day, and he just had a feeling tonight that he'd be stopping the puck, and I think that was the Jets' most dangerous night, and he was excellent.
You know, for us to win, we need to play a good defensive game as a whole, not just the defensemen, but the forwards coming back and taking their man in our zone.
You know, we kind of played the sit-back game after we had a 2-1 lead and tried to play it real cautious, keep men back, but whenever they did get through, Kirk came up huge, and that's all part of playoff hockey.
But I thought in the second period when we were taking the play to them, we didn't really create enough chances driving to the net. We were cycling the puck well, but we tried to get the puck to the net, but every time it seems that we were trying to get the puck to the net, it was getting knocked down. And
you know, we're confident we can go in there and beat them twice, and you know, we're confident we can win the series. If not, why bother go? You know, we're really confident. The 20 guys in here will play well, and we're going to win.
The Canucks are now in the driver's seat. Their victory here at the White House giving them a 3-1 lead in the series, and they will attempt to wrap it up and advance to the second round Tuesday night at Pacific Coliseum. Lisa Bowes, TSN, Winnipeg.
The Leafs were thoroughly thrashed in the first two games of their Norris Division semifinal series with the Red Wings. The only noise louder than the groans of disgruntled Leaf fans was the sound of snapping ankles as their supporters quickly clambered off the bandwagon. But the Leafs, undaunted by their waning support, came back to win game number 3. And they were in position to even the series Sunday at Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto. And a couple of Blue Jays were on hand to catch the Leafs in action. Joe Carter and Devon White saw some physical play as they saw Dave Andrejczyk nailed Dino Cicerelli. Cicerelli got up, and then Andrejczyk nailed him again. Got a hand to Cicerelli. Keeps on coming. Later, Peter Zezel nails Keith Primo up against the board. No score in the first, but early in the second, Sheldon Kennedy sweeps around the net and slides the puck past Felix Pauvan. It's 1-0 Detroit. But the Leafs come back. Dave Andrejczyk, who had 2 goals in Game 3, comes back, puts one here, and in Game 4 ties the game at 1. Later in the second period, Paul Coffey down the left wing, beats Felix Pauvan short side, ties the game at 2 after 2 periods of play. Now watch this big hit. Wendell Clark just nails Bob Probert, who got caught with his head down. Then Glenn Anderson nails Vladimir Konstantinov up against the glass, knocks his helmet right off. Then Andrejczyk goes to work again. His shot goes behind the net, sweeps around, wrap around, puts it in. 3-2, the Leafs leading. Dave Andrejczyk, second of the game. Time right now in the third. The Wings looking for the equalizer. Through the screen, hits the post. Cicerelli, the rebound, cannot tuck it in. Felix Pauvan smothers it. And with that, nothing fishy about this one. The Leafs hang on to beat the Red Wings. We're visiting. 3-2, the final score. Sheldon Kennedy and Paul Coffey, the goals for Detroit. The Leafs tie the series at 2. Mark Osborne with a single, and Dave Andrejczyk with a pair for the Leafs. He has had 2 in each of the Leafs' last 2 games, and the Leafs have won both of those games. With more, here's Rod Smith from the Gardens.
Well, the Red Wings had their way in games 1 and 2, but the Leafs have had theirs here at Maple Leaf Gardens in 3 and 4. You can credit the fans, the emotion, the intensity of this game, and also one player in particular, Dave Andrejczyk, who had his second straight 2-goal game, once again helping shed his reputation as someone who slumps in the playoffs.
Hey, those are the days gone by, that's for sure. Now Toronto Maple Leaf, and this is a fresh start for me. So, hopefully I can just keep doing what I'm doing, what I did in the regular season. And, that's the bottom line. I mean, I got to produce like I did in the regular season.
That was the hardest I've seen this club work. And I know there's some left down. There's a lot of pride in this club right now. And Maple Leaf means something to everybody now, so that's a good sign.
The officiating is a real concern, yes. But you really
You know, you play hard and you just go at it, and hopefully, and you don't take too many penalties.
I thought it was a questionable minor, because, you know, I pushed him with one hand, and you know, he was turning back towards me, and he fell, hit his eye or wherever he was cut on the dasher. And was I surprised it was a major? But as soon as I seen him, as soon as I seen he was cut, I knew he was going to give me a major.
Last time I commented on officials, I was called a whiner in Detroit. In Toronto, with Pat Burns whines about it, and it's okay, but I'm not saying anything about the officials.
A few days ago, the Leafs were written off by a lot of people, but now they're right back in this series. They've not only assured themselves of a Game 5 in Detroit, but a Game 6 back here at Maple Leaf Gardens. Rod Smith, TSN, in Toronto.
Well, we're not done with our NHL playoff recap just yet. It's just a half of it. Coming up next, we'll head to the Meadowlands in New Jersey. The Pens digging for a sweep while the Devils battle to stay alive in the postseason. And then to St. Louis, where Curtis Joseph was looking to slam the door shut on the Hawks' hopes for a Stanley Cup in 93.
A noble warrior advised, the art of protection springs from within. One must stay vigilant against one's unfragrant perspiration, lest one provoke a hostile response. Thus, a Norris ritual is Rygaard Sports Stick. An aromatic array of the freshest scents and unyielding wetness protection.
Confirming the wisdom, the best defense is not to offend.
Rygaard Sports Stick. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Saturday night, Boston bowed out of the postseason via the sweep. Sunday afternoon, Chicago found themselves poised for a similar early departure as they played the Blues trailing 3-0. Brian Sutter and the Bruins fell prey to a hot goalie in Grant Fuhr. His brother, Darryl, faced a comparable foe in Curtis Joseph. Joseph had gone 151 minutes and 9 seconds without giving up a goal, a new franchise record. And he's tested early in this one. Justin Lemieux with a great opportunity when Joseph is down, and Joseph turns him away. Late in the first period, the Blues do open the scoring. Brett Hull redirects Jeff Brown's shot. St. Louis leads 1-0. Second period now. The Hawks finally do get to Curtis Joseph. Chris Chelios gets it to Rich Sutter. Sutter puts it in. 174 minutes without giving up a goal. The streak has come to an end, tied at one. Second period, Hawks get to Joseph again. Jeremy Roenick sends in Jocelyn Lemieux. Puts it by Joseph, 2-1 Chicago. Third period, score tied at two. It's Hull to Janney to Shanahan to the back of the net. St. Louis with a one-goal lead. Late third period, Hawks desperate to tie it up. Rona puts in Steve Larmer's rebound. We are headed to overtime, tied at three. Midway through the first overtime, Ed Belfour gets caught out of the net, bumps into Brett Hull. Belfour is furious as Craig Janney puts the puck into the empty net. Belfour puts his stick under the post, but it's over. It's all done. St. Louis upsetting the Blackhawks in the first round of the playoffs, shutting them out, sweeping them four straight. It was Sutter, Lemieux, and Roenick for the Hawks. For St. Louis, Brett Hull with the pair, Brendan Shanahan and Craig Janney. The Devils also faced elimination on Sunday. They could easily have rolled over and died quietly because no one expects them to come back and take four straight from the Penguins. But instead of tucking their tails between their legs and shuffling off, New Jersey put on a terrific show for the Meadowlands faithful, who have been oh so faithful all season long. The key in this game, shut down Mario Lemieux. The task was given to John McClain. More on that in a moment. First up, though, some goal scoring. Bruce Driver cross ice, Stefan Richier puts it in, and it's 1-0 for the Devils. Now, how do you stop Mario Lemieux? Well, John McClain's got an idea. Look at this. Lemieux is just yelling at the referee for some support. McClain pretending to get up. Chris Durarry keeps his club on top. Sandwich from the shot to point. Save, rebound. Lemieux on the side of the net. It is stopped as well. And John McClain, yeah, he's keeping a handle on Mario Lemieux. The Devils added their lead. Richey cross-ice pass. Tommy Abilene, the one-timer, blasts it in with 9.4 seconds left in the period. 2-0 Devils after two periods. Third period now, 3-0 New Jersey leading. Mario Lemieux in traffic, centers in front to Kevin. Puts it in. 3-1 Penguins trailing. John McClain will have to keep a close eye and a close hand and a close stick and a close grip on Mario Lemieux. And he certainly did in this game. Claude Lemieux adds an empty netter. Devils win this one 4-1. The Devils right back in it. Well, not really. But the Devils are still alive. 3-1, the Penguins lead this series. Stefan Richer, Al Bolin, and Claude Lemieux with a pair for New Jersey. For Pittsburgh, Kevin Stevens, his second of the series. The Penguins had their NHL record 14-game playoff winning streak come to an end at the Meadowlands on Sunday. Goaltending shuffles have been the order of the day in the Smythe Division semifinal between the Flames and the Kings. Mike Vernon was hurt, so Calgary was forced to start Jeff Reese in Game 3. Worked out fine, though. Reese was terrific, and the Flames took a 2-1 series lead. Sunday, Barry Melrose started Rob Stauber in place of Kelly Rudy. No injury, but just as effective a change, and that was the outcome. Mr. Reagan and Nancy Reagan on hand for the game. Midway through the first period, Calgary in the power play. Trent Yanni beat Stauber, 1-0 for the Flames. But later in the period, the Kings on the power play. Alexei Zibnik moves to the outside. Zibnik winds up from the faceoff circle, beats Jeff Reese, 1-1 after one. Big hit early in the second period as Rob Blake nails Roger Johansson in the corner. Midway through the second period, Kings on the power play. Reese stops Thomas Sandstrom, but Reichel follows up for the rebound. No chance for Reese whatsoever, and it's 2-1 L.A. Stauber continues to stone the Flames in this one. Joel Otto gets a couple of whacks at it, but Stauber just shuts the door. Midway through the third, Gary Roberts runs Dave Taylor from behind, and they both end up paying the price for this one. First of all, for his efforts, Gary Roberts gets the toss. And he's not at all happy with those following into the dressing room. And meanwhile, Dave Taylor, well, he's got a broken nose, but he's still in the game. Pat Conacher seals it for the Kings, empty netter. And with that, it was sealed. The Kings at home win it 3-1, tie the series at 2 games apiece. Goal scorers, Trent Yanni for Calgary. For L.A., it was Zitnik, Reichel, and Pat Conacher. The Kings have yet to get a goal from Wayne Gretzky, Thomas Sandstrom, Tony Granato,
or Luke Wilson. The championship. Don't miss the break. Thursday, 5 Eastern on Real TV, TSN.
Coming up on Sports Desk, the Cold War between Montreal and Quebec heats up in game number 5. The Devils try to block Pittsburgh on their run to a third Stanley Cup. In Vancouver, the Canucks would like to ground the Jets for the season. Morris the Cat's given another life against the Rangers. And put on the body armor or you will be stung by our plays of the week. Sports Desk. Brought to you by Chevy Truck.
Hi again, everyone. Welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. This week certainly started off with a bang in sports. A couple of hockey teams facing elimination in the Stanley Cup playoffs and another skirmish in the Battle of Quebec. And a couple of ex-Blue Jays come back to the Sky Dome as members of the Texas Rangers. We'll show you all of that, but first, though, let's go to the hockey. People had started writing the obituaries for the Montreal Canadiens about a month ago. They staggered at the end of the season, you recall, and they fell to third place. They had to open the playoffs on the road, lost two in Quebec City, and were given up for dead by many hockey fans. But then they won two in Montreal to even things up. Back to Quebec City Monday night for what would be a great, great playoff hockey game. Let's take you there. Pierre Paget hoping his boys can get back to winning. Story of the game, disallowed goals for Montreal. Kirk Muller kicks one in here. Goal judges caught that throw. They disallowed that. Then Vincent Danfous puts in his own rebound. But for some reason, they ruled that Muller had knocked Hextall down. No goal. Jacques Demers says, two against us. I don't know. Quebec leading 2-1 in the second period. Vince Danfous, a backhander, he says it's in. Says it went off the middle crossbar. The referees aren't sure. After they check, it does count. It's a goal for Montreal, and the game's tied at 2. Some heavy hitting in this one. Look at Mike Huff complete the Nordique sandwich on J.J. Daniel, and they leave him not sure where he is. Matter of fact, on to the third period. The Nords are up 4-3 now, and the puck will be centered to Gilbert Dion. Quick release, low stick side on Hextall. Game tied at 4. Vince Danfous, cross ice to Muller. Muller lets it go quickly. Not a great shot, but good enough for the win. Montreal wins this one by a score of 5-4 in overtime once again, and they lead the series 3-2 going back to the Forum. Goal scorers Mike Keane, Vincent Danfous, Desjardins, Gilbert Dion, and Kirk Muller with the overtime winner after 8 minutes of the extra period. Kovalenko, Owen Nolan, and Sundin with a pair get goals for Quebec. This is the 10th overtime game so far in the playoffs. That is a new Stanley Cup record for any round
any year. And TSN's Michael Whalen sat through it all and sends us this report from Quebec.
It was rather a bizarre game in which there were three disputed goals, two that were vetoed by the video judges and one that a goal judge did not even see. And there was a broken pane of glass and a somewhat broken goaltender in Patrick Waugh, who came back and put on a courageous show to be the hero of this Game 5.
I felt great. That's the reason why I told Jacques, I said, if you want me to go back, I'm ready to go, because I felt great. The only reason why I gave that first goal was because I could move my arm. And, you know, I went out there and I was sharp, and all that mattered for me was make the saves, and I just didn't want to let the guys down.
Patrick Waugh, our Joe Montana. Joe Montana is one of the greatest athletes to ever play in any sport. Gets hurt, always comes back. Joe Montana, and the reason why I say that is because Patrick Waugh has made some statesmen. He lives with his statesmen. He's a competitor. He's the leader of our hockey club. We have some other leaders. I've got to be making sure that not to forget guys like Mutter and Carbo. There's other leaders here, and Brian Bellows and Demfus. But Patrick Waugh stands up, speaks, and everybody listens.
The key to our club, I think, tonight was we kept our composure, stuck with it somehow, and somehow got a win out of it.
Well, I think we're all a little bit scared, you know, and when you're scared, you know, we're backed into a little bit of a corner. We got to come out fighting, I think. You know, I think playing a little bit scared, a little bit desperate is what, you know, what this team needs, and that's what we have to do when we go into the forum.
And so the scene now shifts back to Montreal, where indeed the Nordiques will have to learn to play scared if they don't want to be eliminated in this series. Michael Whalen, TSN, from the Colisée in Quebec City.
Interesting. So Montreal wins three in a row. Now, what about the Penguins? They were bumped off the rails slightly on Sunday on their ride toward what many feel will be their third Stanley Cup. Now, the Devils beat them in New Jersey to stay alive. Good game for goalie Chris Terreri and for perennial playoff standout Claude Lemieux. But the Penguins are back home Monday night looking to end this first round. Let's go to the Civic Arena. And the Puckheads were out there, and they're happy early. Kevin Stevens to Mario Lemieux, and through Chris Terreri's legs, 1-0 for the Penguins, and the fans show their appreciation. They love number 66. 2-1 Penguins a little bit later, and they're on the power play, but Bruce Driver, the Devils, carries over the line, lets a wrist shot go, Barrasso screened, and the game is tied at 2. Second period, good staff passing here. Stastny to Abilene, beats Barrasso, and the Devils go in front 3-2 in the second period. Third period, though, power play for the Penguins. Ron Francis tees it up from over there and blows it by Terreri, game tied at 3. Seconds later, so many weapons on that Pittsburgh team. Dave Tippett down the side shot, gloved rebound by Jeff Daniels. He puts it down and puts it in. 4-3 Penguins. A little later, the Devils are pressing, and it's going to be Lemieux out of the corner right in front to Richie, but look at a save by Barrasso. Penguins at an empty netter a little bit later, and they really put the bite on New Jersey in this one. The final score, 5-3, and that is the series in 5 games. The Pittsburgh Penguins knock out New Jersey. Mario Lemieux, Rick Tocchet, Ron Francis, and Jeff Daniels with a pair. Stefan Richey, Bruce Driver, and Tommy Abilene with the last 3 goals this season for New Jersey. Penguins will meet the winner of the Washington-New York Islanders series. Let's go check that one out at Landover, where Don Beaupre got the start. Tabarachi had played most of the games for Washington in this postseason. First period, right off the faceoff, Sylvain Côté with a blast from the point. Well, I don't know if it was a blast, but it got by Glenn Healy, 1-0 cap. A little bit later, game tied at 1, Ali Afraidy tees it up. This is a blast. His shot goes through the legs of Healy, 2-1 Washington. Then Bobby Carpenter will give it to Iafredi on the left side. He lets it go, bad angle, but it gets by Healy again. 3-1 caps, couple of goals for Alfie. And the only thing New York can do right now is provide a good seat for the on-ice officials. This game does get physical at times. Watch Richard Pilon take Mike Ridley out behind the net into the boards. Then Vladimir Malakhov with a great open ice hit on Peter Bondra right there. 5-2 Capitals in the third. Uwe Krupp will find Ray Ferraro alone in the slot. He makes a quick move to go to the other side and slide it under Don Beaupre. 5-3 caps, third of the game for Ferraro. A little bit later, the caps are pressing, and who pops it in? Yeah, Ray Ferraro. 4 goals in the game. That makes it 5-4, but that was not enough because Washington added a goal after that, and they stay alive. The Washington Capitals beat the New York Islanders 6-4 and extend the series. Sylvain Côté, Pat Elniak, Dale Hunter, and Al Iafredi with 3 goals. Ray Ferraro with all 4 for the Islanders. He has 8 in the series. The record is 12 by Yari Kurri. Game 6 will be on Long Island Wednesday, and that one will be on TSN.
Simon Mann sets the stage for the NBA playoffs. Get it all today on Real TV TSN.
On TSN Sports Desk, the Canucks are hoping that the West Coast is the best coast. The Leafs are budding in April. They'd like to bloom in June, though. Bennis is a bonus for the Padres as he goes for a no-no against the Expos. The NBA promises it will come to Canada in 95, and Peter Parkinson may be serious about pulling the Oilers out of Edmonton.
Desk is brought to you by Right Guard Antiperspirant. Anything less would be uncivilized.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to another edition of TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. We've got a jam-packed show for you, a couple of exciting NHL games, so let's get right to the playoff action. Not hard to read the pattern or the strategies for the Winnipeg Jets and the Vancouver Canucks. The way their series has gone, the Jets need Solani to score if they're going to have any hope at all. The game they won, he scored three. So the Canucks' objective in Game 5 at home was simple. Tie up Tamu again and try to put the Jets away for good. And John Paddock knows that, so he knows number 13 has to score. The Jets do strike first. Not number 13, though. It's number 4, Olsson from the point. Darren Shannon gets a stick on the way in. The Jets have a 1-0 lead. Vancouver ties it up quickly. Gerald Diddick with a shot. Bob Essence can't control it. It comes off the board, hits his stick, and goes into the net. A fluky one, but it's 1-1. Late in the first, 2-1 Canucks, Dave Babbage with the shot. Greg Adams will bank the rebound in off a Jets defenseman. 3-1 Vancouver, not looking good for John Paddock and the Jets. Bobby Essence, though, holds them in. Key saves. Watch him stop Trevor Linden in close as Courtnell gets it out to Linden. Essence are right there to kick it away. Third period, Canucks ahead 3-2. Darren Shannon, quick shot in front. Zing, and it's in. He's got a pair, and it's a 3-3 tie. Then the Jets have a chance for the winner, Solani on a breakaway. This is what they want. He goes to the forehand, but McLean stays with him. Huge save. And they go to overtime. Solani around Merzen, throws it in front. Throws it in front again. And it's kicked in by a Vancouver defenseman. The Jets stay alive with a huge victory in Vancouver. The final score, 4-3. Darren Shannon with a pair. Keith Tkachuk and Tamu Solani with the overtime winner. A fluky one. They all count. 2 minutes into overtime. Diddick, Bure, and Greg Adams replying for Vancouver. So the Jets have a life and head back to Winnipeg. Let's head now to Vancouver and TSN's David Pratt.
And so the Jets do what very few people thought they could do. Come in here to the Pacific Coliseum and take one from the Canucks. And in doing so, force Game 6 back in Winnipeg.
Accomplish what we want to do and just winning a game to stay alive. So, you know, nothing's changed too much yet. We're in the same predicament Thursday as we were tonight.
It's a great feeling, especially coming back from 2 goals. We had to weather the storm there in the first part of the overtime because they came up really charged up and Bobby made some big saves for us. And, you know, I think Timo made a great play. He just threw it at the net and things happen when you get the puck to the net, unlike what we didn't do in Game 4.
I just tried to pass the puck to the net and it hit some Vancouver guy skate and win team, so.
And now the series goes back to Winnipeg with the Canucks still leading 3-2. David Pratt, TSN, Vancouver.
All right, thank you, David. When the Calgary Flames went into their series with the LA Kings, they knew they would have to shut down the Shooters. And although the Kings have won 2 games, the Flames have done the job on the LA Snipers. Gretzky has been held in check pretty much, and the Kings' big shooter, Luke Robitaille, was held without a goal. Game 5 Tuesday at the Saddle Dome, and the Flames would be without one of their hot shooters, Gary Roberts, out with a bit of a leg injury. Kings start quickly in this one. It's going to be Sandstrom scoring a beautiful goal on a lovely deke pass from Jimmy Carson. Rob Stauber in net for LA, stopped 17 in the first period, including this one from Brian Skrudland. Still 1-0 Kings. Later in the period, Corey Millen cruises in, feeds to Mike Donnelly. He doesn't have much room, but gets it up over Jeff Reese. Before he goes up over Jeff Reese, 2-0 Kings. Still in the first, LA completes a great first period. Tim Waters pinches in at the blue line, keeps it in, slides it to Pat Conacher, who whips it in past Jeff Reese. 3-0 Kings after one. The Kings led 5-2 after two, and then early in the third, the Flames cut into that lead. Chris Dahlquist, top corner there on Stauber. makes it 5-3 for L.A., but the Kings pulled away. 6-3 L.A. Gretzky throws it in front. It goes in off Kevin Dahl's helmet, then his stick. A sticker by Gretzky, and they lead 7-3. Once again, Rob Stauber, great. Look at this glove save on Chris Dahlquist. Stauber with the big glove save. And the Kings go on to pound the Flames in Calgary. 9-4, your final. Konecker had a pair. Luke Robitaille broke out of his slump. He scored two. Reichel, Donnelly, Sandstrom, Gretzky, and Tony Granato. Gretzky had three assists and the one goal. Neuendijk, Musil, Dahlquist, and Theo Fleury for Calgary. The Flames have not won a playoff series since their 1989 Cup victory. They are going back to L.A. on the ropes. And here is TSN's Peter Watts.
Grit as much as talent won Game 5 for the Los Angeles Kings, personified by no less a personality, the number 10, Warren Reichel.
We haven't won a thing yet, that's the important thing. We realize we haven't won a thing yet until we win one more game, and we're focused to win that game at home. We don't want to come back here. We want to win that game, and it's good to get the attention, but the playoff team things are first, and everything I do is for the team, and everything that everybody does in this room is for the team, and it showed tonight.
We knew it was going to be a tough game tonight. Some of us have played in this building an awful lot over the years, and it's one of the tougher buildings to play in, and it was a nice win.
The LA's got a chance to eliminate us at home, so you know they're going to come out really gunning and going after us, and you know, we've always, in every series, had some room for error because it's only the second or third game, and so you know, it's not D-Day yet. Now it's D-Day.
The bottom line, it's not over. We haven't lost the farm yet, and we just have to go out there and take it one game at a time.
And so grit, coupled with talent, came to the fore for the Kings. As a result, they go home to Los Angeles with a 3-2 series lead. They can wrap up this semifinal Thursday night on home ice. Peter Watts, TSN, in Calgary.
Well, this is the time of the year for the NHL's pluggers, the fourth liners, the role players. These guys are not noticed much through the regular season, but their contribution becomes huge in the tight-checking atmosphere of the NHL playoffs. And that was the case Tuesday night in Detroit as the Maple Leafs and the Red Wings hooked up in Game 5 of their series, and a plugger would become a hero. Pat Burns hoping that his Leafs can withstand the heat in Detroit. They don't early on. This one by Dino Cicerelli in alone makes it 4-1 Detroit early in the game. The Leafs look in trouble, but they start the comeback. Pearson nailed behind the net by Primo. Delayed penalty. Puck comes back to Dave Ellett. You can't see him shoot it, but he beats Tim Chevalier and makes it 4-2 for Detroit. Second period coming to a close now. Leafs on the power play. Ellett again from the point. Lets it go through a crowd. And it's 4-3 for Detroit. The Leafs close it within one. Midway through the third, Wendell Clark out from behind the net, tries one, comes back to him. He throws through a crowd. It bounces off the head of Detroit's Yves Racine, and in it goes. A little bit later, game tied at 4. Bill Berg with a great chance to win it, but no hands in close. So it goes to overtime. Wendell Clark flips it over here to Foligno, settles the puck, lets it go, and it's in. And here's the jump from Foligno, the overtime winner. And the Maple Leafs with a huge comeback. Down 4-1, they come back to take it 5-4 in OT. Foligno had the overtime winner. Ellett had a pair. Clark had the tying goal. And Andrychuk had the first one. Gallant, Fedorov, Shepard, and Dino Cicerelli for Detroit. No sign of Steve Yzerman. And the Leafs lead this series 3-2 going home. More now from TSN's Rod Smith.
Halfway through this game, it looked like the Wings were going to win it as easily as they did in games 1 and 2. But with that 3-goal lead, something happened as Toronto came back and out-hustled Detroit through much of the latter part of the game, tying the score on a Wendell Clark goal in the third period, and then Clark set up Mike Foligno in overtime for the winner.
Tonight, this definitely was the biggest goal of my career, and I remember the first game in this rink that I played here when it first opened up, the first game, and tonight is probably the first time that anything has been more memorable than that night.
And when you get a guy like Mike Foligno scoring the goal, who's in the lineup all year and has as much heart and soul as anybody, it's great because that means it's a 20-team effort, and that's the only way we will win, and we got a tougher one left ahead of us.
I wasn't real happy, you know, with the third goal, and the overtime goal was a goal that, like I said, just should have been more patient, and just stood there and waited for it.
We haven't won anything yet. There's nothing, and they were told that. We haven't won absolutely nothing yet. We just, the two games we won in Toronto put ourselves back in the series, and this one just put ourselves ahead, that's all, but nothing won yet.
This loss has left the Red Wings in a bit of shock, although they deny they were expecting an easy series. It certainly looked that way after games 1 and 2, but they've got more spunk than they can deal with from the Toronto Maple Leafs right now. And as a result, the Leafs are the team that can be moving on to the second round with a win in Game 6. Rod Smith, TSN, in Detroit.
All right, thank you, Rod. So the Kings and the Maple Leafs head home to...
Coming up on Sportsnet, two more series finish with a flurry. DiPietro powers the Habs into the Adams final. And the Islanders say, bring on the Pens. These Caps are all washed up. Also, Canada blows by Finland at the Worlds. Scott Brow is given a rookie welcome to the big leagues. And we'll look back at the life of Jimmy V.
Desk brought to you by Men and Speed Stick. Get the wide stick for long lasting 110% odor protection.
Hi, everybody. Great to welcome you to the show. I'm Michael Landsberg.
And I'm Brendan Connor. Welcome to the show. We have a terrific program ahead, which, of course, begins with the NHL and the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Two excellent first-round matches continue this evening.
And one that we're going to get to right away, the series everybody figured would be outstanding, and everyone who did figure that way was right.
Absolutely. There is a good chance the Stanley Cup final won't be nearly as good as the first-round Adams semifinal. Montreal-Quebec has just been terrific. Virtually every game could have gone in either direction. The difference in the series heading into tonight's Game 6 was a weak shot by Kirk Muller in overtime in Game 5. Gave the Habs a chance to put away the hated Nordique on home ice. Pierre Paget knows that the last one slipped away, and he knows that his team has really got to get off to a quick start in this one, but they do not. John LeClair with a nice effort here. Ed Ronan works his way in front of the net. Uncontested, Ronan scores. Then he gets taken out, but it's too late as he beats Hextall 1-0. Montreal frustrated by Quebec. Elbow on this play. It goes Sundin right into the face of Desjardins. And Demers is livid, saying, you got to call that, and he's right. He should have. Moved to the second period, just 1:13. And DiPietro on the 2-on-1 gives a little look over to Domfus, and I think that fooled Ron Hextall. 2-0 for the Canadians. Pierre Paget calls a timeout to try to settle down his squad, and it seems to work less than a minute later. Richie shot a stop, but Claude Lapointe knocks it in. The lead is cut in half. Now Quebec on the power play. Joe Sakic at the point. Sakic moves into the slot. Here's the view that Waugh gets. You can see not much of a view. Screen, it trickles through and scores from the stick of Sakic. We're tied at 2, but Montreal storms back. DiPietro down the wing. Somehow he scores from a terrible angle. Hextall clearly not real sharp on that one. 3-2 for the Habs. Just before the end of the second, Montreal pressing. Hextall makes the save on Bellows, but Kirk Muller is there to put it in. Pierre Paget then with an unusual move calls on Stéphane Fissette. To complete the period, Hextall takes a seat on the bench. He gave up that seat for the third period. He was back in the action, and he sees DiPietro once again. DiPietro moves down, and this terrific junior at Sudbury, 56 goals last year, 3 on this night. He only had 4 all season long. Denny Savard and Patrick Waugh can hug and kiss because the Montreal Canadiens were 6-2 winners over the Quebec Nordiques. That means they win the series 4-2. Keep in mind they lost the first 2 games in Quebec, and they storm back to win the next 4. The key one, I think, being the last one in Quebec in that overtime goal. Lapointe and Sakic, DiPietro with 3, Ronan, Muller, and Dinan. Once again, DiPietro playing for LeBeau had 4 points in just his third career playoff game. Was he happy? You bet he was.
It was just a great game. You know, the guys come out strong, and just one of those games. Everything goes right for you, and it's just a great game. I just wanted to be here with the boys and celebrate it and go into Buffalo, but the boys play well all series, and you know, we just come out strong tonight, and we got on the big guns, and that's we hurt them.
So DiPietro and the Montreal Canadiens will now begin the Adams Division Final at home on Sunday. Again, they host the Buffalo Sabres. It appears as though Grant Fuhr's knee is in pretty good shape right now. He should definitely be able to play in Game 1 of that series. Should be pretty interesting. Montreal against Buffalo, Game 1 on Sunday. Michael Whalen was at the Forum this evening. He's compiling a full report. You saw a bit of it, and we'll have that a little bit later in the show as Montreal advances to the Adams Final.
Meantime, Game 6 of the Washington Islanders series was on Long Island tonight with the Caps down 3-2. Now, Dale Hunter has been great in this series. 6 goals in the 5 games to date. The Caps would like another goal or two from him, but also some production from Kevin Hatcher. He led all NHL defensemen this year with 34 in the regular season, but none in the playoffs in the 5 games to date. Hatcher has actually been under criticism for using his stick for hitting people. More on that later. Caps open the scoring with a lovely passing play. Over to Elnick and back to the trailer. Dale Hunter, bang, number 7 of the playoffs, 1-0 Caps.
The victim of a Game 5 slash from Hatcher will tie this game. It's Steve Thomas. Nice passing again. Derek King sets up Thomas at the side of the net. He ties the game at one. Second period, another victim of a Hatcher slash does it here. Great effort by Benoit Hogue as he is in alone, sort of fighting off the defenseman, fights him off, spins, and tucks it underneath Donnie Beaupre. 2-1, the Isles have the lead. A little bit later, Darius Kasparaitis in the corner with a great hip check on Pat Elniak. Don Beaupre getting shelled in this one. Makes a great stop here on Travis Green, but Delgarno is there to drill the rebound. Washington goes up 3-1, or the Islanders go up 3-1. 14 seconds left in the second. Third period, the Caps come out flying, but they run into a hot Glenn Healy. Big glove save there on Kristich. Then a great glove save again on Hatcher from the point. Caps out shooting the Isles 11-1 in the third, but coming away empty to that point. 4-1 now. Dale Hunter gives it away, and Turgeon cashes in, and check out the cheap shot here. Well after the goal, Hunter runs Turgeon from the side, knocks him into the boards. Now he had his arm up in the air celebrating, and he was very vulnerable, and he fell into the boards, and boy, the Islanders went after Dale Hunter for that cheap shot. Turgeon makes it 5-1, but leaves the game injured. The Capitals actually don't give up, even though it's 5-1. They score a shorthanded goal. Nick Kiprios does, 5-2. Then Aya Frady moves in off the draw and scores to cut the lead to 5-3. Still, it was all too little, too late. Terry Murray knows this one is over. The Islanders advance to face Pittsburgh as they down Washington by a score of 5-3 in this one, and they win the series in six. Thomas, Hogue, Delgarno, Green, and Turgeon doing the scoring. Hunter, Krieger, and Aya Frady for the Washington Capitals. And once again, Washington goes out in the first round. The Isles advance to the second round for the first time since 1987. And the man who was wearing the C for the Islanders, Pat Flatley, had these thoughts afterwards.
Well, the series was, I thought it was a real grinding series, and we were very fortunate in all the overtime games. We didn't... Tonight was the closest we came to putting together 60 minutes, and I think the results were evident. But the other games were great games. The overtime games were very entertaining for those watching, not for the guys playing.
Go on, you Islanders all love OT. The Islanders will open the Patrick Division final on the road against the defending Stanley Cup champion Pittsburgh Penguins. Game one goes this Sunday at the Igloo. You got to love the coaching matchup, Scotty Bowman against Al Arbor.
I think you got to really admire the way Al Arbor has turned around this franchise. Really, this, I think, perhaps came out of nowhere for the Islanders, and it looks good on them.
Yeah, they struggled to make even fourth place in that division. Had to fight off the Rangers and managed to knock off the first-round opponents, the Washington, who finished higher, but Washington has a tradition of that.
Well, keep in mind that big deal, the Pat LaFontaine deal, and immediately people figured the Buffalo Sabres got the better of them.
Giants, Saturday, 4 Eastern. Expos baseball, nobody plays it like Real TV. TSN.
Ahead on TSN Sports Desk, we'll check out the battle between the Jets and the Canucks in Winnipeg. On a wing and a prayer, Detroit stays alive in Game 6. Oh, what a feeling John Olerud gets at the plate for the Jays. He's back in black and white. Dave Steeb starts for the Sox. And the NBA playoffs get in your face.
Sports Dance, brought to you by Mizuno, the world of sports, manufacturer of quality footwear and sporting equipment. And by Wiser Lock, Canada's first choice in lock security.
Hello, everyone. I'm Brendan Connor, welcoming you once again to TSN Sports Desk. The hockey playoffs continue to dominate the sports news, although it looks as if Friday night is now going to be a dark night in the NHL playoffs for a change. Thursday certainly was not a dark night. Three big games, so let's start right there. The Winnipeg Jets fought back and won in overtime this week in Game 5 in Vancouver, stayed alive in their Smythe Division semifinal. But it was a really lucky goal by Teemu Selänne, by his own admission. The Canucks remain confident going into Winnipeg, but they are a bit wary of the Jets playing at home. That white-clad crowd, the white noise, seems to fire up Selänne and his teammates, and it was more white noise on Thursday night. First period, Jets are up 1-0, and the Canucks tie it on a controversial goal. Slager shot from the point, tipped in by a high stick where Greg Adams, but even after checking the replay, They count it, and John Paddock is not amused. Some big hits in this game. Doug Lidster taking Keith Tkachuk into the boards as Tkachuk tries to go around him. Second period, Mike Eagles does some hard work. The Jets dig it out from behind the net. Over to Eagles. He centers for Andy Brickley, the trigger man. It doesn't get much action for the Jets, but he gets a big goal in this one, and it's 2-1 Winnipeg. Third period, Winnipeg up 3-2. Yerke Lume's shot is stopped. Sergio Momesso gobbles up a loose puck, though, and shovels it under. Bob Essensa ties the score at 3. Late in the game, seconds remaining. Peter Nedved, quick shot. Momesso bangs in the rebound, but the green light had come on before the red light went on. That means the game was over. They checked the tapes, and Paul Stewart says no goal. Time had run out. They go to overtime, 3-3. Less than 5 minutes into overtime, another controversial goal wins it. Greg Adams driving to the net. His shot is stopped, but his momentum carries him in, and the puck goes in. The Jets object, but referee Paul Stewart allows this one and tells the Jets the game and their season is over. A 4-3 final in Winnipeg. Vancouver wins it on Greg Adams' second goal of the game, 5 minutes into overtime. Adams had a pair, Craven had one, and Momesso had the other. Barnes, Brickley, and Tkachuk for Winnipeg. The Canucks eliminate the Jets in six. Second straight year, Vancouver has beaten out Winnipeg. Here's TSN's Lisa Bowes in Winnipeg.
It was a dramatic finish to a very intense series. Video replay a main factor as it sent this game into overtime. And 4 minutes and 30 seconds into the extra period, the Jets' season was over and the Canucks were moving on.
My cut towards the net, I knew I couldn't get a shot away, so I just wanted to carry it at the net for me and hope something happened. I got a lucky bounce.
I thought we won it a couple times there, and you know, to be turned away like that and then go into overtime, you know, it was nice to see something go in and finally end it.
I'm really thankful we were able to get the goal in overtime and end it, because this Jet team was coming on.
We got beat, you know, in overtime in the hell of a series. And we got a great future in this dressing room. You know, a lot of young guys, a lot of talent, and a lot of grit and determination and character. You know, we got a great blend of everything. And it just, oh, man, it just, what do you compare? I don't know what to compare it to, this empty, lonesome feeling.
It was a very strange game tonight with a lot of controversy and different things. So disappointing that it ended. It's disappointing how it ended. Only in the fact that I think that there should have been a review on the goal and then see what happened, because it was kicked in.
It's a judgment call, but you know, it's a playoff type goal. It's hard working. You go to the net, you drive to the net, good things happen, and you know, obviously the Canucks were rewarded.
And so Vancouver ends the series in overtime at the White House. As for the Jets, they are on the outside looking in, but looking ahead to their future in the Central Division. Lisa Bowes, TSN, Winnipeg.
All right, thank you, Lisa. So the Jets are out, and the Canucks looking ahead for a winner between Calgary and Los Angeles. They didn't have to wait long. The Kings led the series 3-2. They were home for Game 6 on Thursday. So far, not exactly a prime example of playoff hockey in this series. But if you like high-scoring hockey, the Smythe semifinal between the Flames and the Kings may have been to your liking. More high-scoring stuff on Thursday as the Kings look to put it away. Let's go to the Great Western Forum, where Gary Roberts is back in the Flames lineup, and Joe Nieuwendyk and the Flames open the scoring. Nieuwendyk's backhander, and Pozlowski comes out from behind the net to jam the rebound in. 1-0 Calgary. Kings tie it up on a beauty. Wayne Gretzky, top of the slot, a big blast, beats Jeff Reese, ties it at 1. Late in the first, Gretzky a factor again. He drops for Charlie Huddy. Huddy finds Dave Taylor in front. He spins and jams it in under Reese, and the veteran gives LA a 3-2 lead after 1. Kings add to their lead. Yari Curry steps over the line here and smokes one past Jeff Reese inside the post. LA leads 4-2 now, and Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan guess to Bruce McNall, liking what they see. Calgary fights back, though. Al McGinnis from the point here, one of his howitzers, ties the game at 4, but the Kings get 2 at the end of the second period. Vintage Wayne Gretzky here, carries, circles, finds Rob Blake. Little wrist shot here. That beats Reese, and the Kings lead 5-4. Not Jeff Reese's night. 6-4 LA, and check out the muscle by Joel Otto here. Comes out from behind the net, holds off Huddy, and backhands it in past Stauber. Cuts the lead to 6-5. With the Kings up 7-6. Mike Donnelly is stopped in close. Corey Millen gets a couple of shots. There's one. The second one's a knuckler, a wobbler, but it gets in. 8-6 LA. They go on to win this one 9-6. They win by a field goal, and they eliminate the Calgary Flames in 6 games. The Flames still haven't won a playoff series since they won the Cup in 89. Goal scorers, 2 for Sandstrom, Gretzky, Taylor, Curry, Blake, Granato, Millen, and Carson.
Pozlowski, Roberts, Fleury, McInnes, Otto, and Dahlquist for Calgary. Jeff Reese, a bad night, allowing 8 goals on 18 shots. The Kings, 9 goal games back-to-back. For a post-game report, let's go to TSN's Peter Watts in L.A.
It was a game that fit the pattern of this series. Over 60 shots on goal, 16 pucks went in the net. And in the end, the Kings had too much firepower, and the Flames didn't have a good enough defense. And that was the story, both of Game 6 and of this series.
It doesn't matter how you win, as long as you win it. We're going to go back to the drawing board, take a look at Vancouver, maybe try to tighten our own zone up a little bit. We're not going to get too ahead of ourselves. We're not going to get too high right now. We believe we got a lot of hockey left.
We really had to battle tonight. I don't think anything came easy. Calgary kept, you know, fighting back, but Rob Sauber made a lot of big saves in there for us, and some of our big guns got us some big goals down the stretch.
Very physical series. We knew that going in that Calgary was going to be extremely physical, and if we're fortunate enough to get by, that probably Vancouver is going to be on the doorstep, and that's who's there. And we expect the same kind of series, very physical, very tough, just good hard hockey. And you know, it's amazing, you know, you don't have to fight to have physical hockey. It's good, tough physical hockey, and I think the fans loved it.
If we could have kept the puck out of our net, probably, you know, we would have had a better chance at winning, because, you know, we offensively, we were great, 42 shots, and we generated everything we could at the net, and we got 6 goals, but they got 9, so 18 goals in 2 games, you give up that many, you're not going to win a series.
I don't think our team has anything to be ashamed of. We worked hard all season long, and you know, really had a tough series with these guys, but there's a lot of times during tonight where a lot of teams would have packed it in and said, well, we gave it a shot, but we kept fighting right till the very end. So this team has worked hard all year, and we got a lot of character. I think everyone can hold their heads up.
So the Kings win the game 9-6. They win the series 4-2, and they move on to play the Vancouver Canucks starting Monday night at the Pacific Coliseum in Vancouver. Peter Watts, TSN, Los Angeles.
Well, actually, that Smythe final will open on Sunday. They have switched it to a Sunday. Game 1 between the Kings and the Canucks as they go at it for the top honors in the Smythe division. Sunday, game number 1. Meanwhile, in the Norris division, if you have been listening to some of the media in Toronto over the past couple of days, you would think the Maple Leafs have a yellow brick road now to the Stanley Cup Finals after their miracle comeback win in Detroit in game number 5. But the Leafs and their coach, Pat Burns, knew better than to think the Red Wings were through. Game 6 in Toronto Thursday proved the Wings are far from through. Let's go to Maple Leaf Gardens and show you highlights. The lights go out momentarily on Brian Murray and his team. Vladimir Konstantinov, though, out for bear early as he rubs Doug Gilmour into the boards. Wings get on the board first. Power play and Coffey, his shot hit the post, and Dallas Drake tucks it in. 1-0 Detroit. Leafs come right back. Bob Rouse shot from the point. He's stopped, but Peter Zezel with the rebound puts it right into the middle of the net. Game even at 1. Before the end of the first, the Leafs strike again. Good work by Andrechuk. Lifts the stick of Konstantinov. What Chevalier is doing out there, we don't know, but Andrechuk gets an easy one. 2-1 Leafs, and the fans are making noise at the Gardens. It quieted down quickly in the second, though. Early in the second, another power play. Dino Cicerelli jams a rebound in, ties the game at 2, and Pat Burns is furious with his club's effort to start the second period. The effort doesn't improve. Detroit shorthanded now, leading 3-2, and they send Paul Eisenbart in alone. He goes between the legs of Felix Potvin, 4-2 Wings. The Wings are up 5-2, and they get another shorthanded goal. Burr out front to an uncovered Iserman. He goes upstairs, and it's 6-2 Detroit. Bad news for the Maple Leafs there as Peter Zezel gets crunched into the boards. He had to be helped off. A little bit of a concussion, and he's probably happy he didn't see the end of this one. 7-3, the Red Wings pummel the Maple Leafs in Toronto in Game 6. Cicerelli had 3. He was in the crease all night again. Dallas Drake, Paul Coffey, Paul Eisenbart, and Steve Yzerman with the singles. Zezel, Andrechuk, and Lefebvre for Toronto. Coffey had a 4-point night. The Wings had 4 power play goals and 2 shorthanded. This one's tied, 3 games apiece, and here is TSN's Rod Smith.
No big comeback for the Toronto Maple Leafs on this night. This time they fell behind and stayed behind as Detroit, like in games 1 and 2, absolutely dominated the special teams. The Red Wings had 4 goals on the power play and 2 more shorthanded, more than enough to send this series back to Motown for a 7th game.
Well, we talked a bit after the second period when it was 6-2. About just keep going, although we did play pretty conservative in the third. We didn't want to, you know, really give them any life or hope to give them any life.
Their better players showed up tonight, and they were at their best. There's no doubt about that. And They were just a bit too good for us tonight.
We wanted to play better than that, and unfortunately we got ourselves in some trouble with the penalty killing, and we just got to get bounced back. I mean, I think we expected a little bit more. Maybe we expected it somehow an easier game. I don't know why.
We didn't play well defensively. And when you don't play well against well defensively against a team like Detroit, you're going to get burnt, and we obviously got burnt tonight.
Do you feel some pride in the players, the way they came back with the last three games and the momentum swinging?
Well, some of them have taken so much heat. I'm an old guy. I can take heat, but I felt real bad for a couple of guys in our team, real bad, and I was real proud of them. I was real proud of the whole group, but guys that were Tim Chevalier, Steve Eisman, people like that that had to get the job done, I thought they really stepped to the front for us.
When you're in a playoff situation like this, goaltending, special teams are what's going to win it for you and lose it for you, and we made them pay tonight.
We can't be any worse than what we were tonight.
So as it turns out, the road to St. Louis will go through Joe Louis, an arena the Red Wings are quite confident in, but one the Maple Leafs know at least they can win in when they have to, and both teams have to now. Rod Smith, TSN, in Toronto.
Well, still with hockey news, the New York Islanders may not have much chance against the Penguins in the Patrick Final. That opens up on Sunday, but now the Isles will be without their top scorer, Pierre Turgeon. He is out with a separated shoulder, courtesy of a Dale Hunter cheap shot. The new NHL commissioner, Gary Bettman, was at that game and saw it, and will deal with Dale Hunter, with a lot of the hockey world demanding a firm hand.
We decided, because of the shortness of time that the Capitals had to focus on what had to be done today, and the fact that I think they're still recovering from the elimination, that they wanted an opportunity to be heard further on the extent and duration of the suspension, although it's clear that we have found that there will be a suspension without pay for regular season games for next season. And in addition, we wanted an opportunity to evaluate the medical reports on Thursday.
Coming up on Sports Desk, unbelievable finish at Joe Louis Arena between Toronto and Detroit. Canada has to settle for no medal at the Worlds. Time to see who's the hero in Louisville. Morris running out of lives with the Blue Jays. So sit back and enjoy as we glide through the night's action.
Herbert along with Gino Retta tonight. Ahead on the show, the Expos taking on Bonds, Barry Bonds, and the San Francisco Giants.
And of course, Teresa, we'll look ahead to the next round of the NHL playoffs as well.
We'll also look back at one of the teams eliminated, but first to the final game of round one. Gene?
And Teresa, a great one. You know, no one wants a game seven. Neither team nor the fans want to see game seven. But in reality, there are a few things more exciting than watching the seventh and deciding game of a playoff series. The Wings and the Leafs at Joe Louis Arena. We could spend time talking about the stats, trends, and momentum, but none of that matters anymore. The winner goes on, the loser goes home. Let's check out the action. Of course, a lot of pressure on Felix Pauvin, probably playing his biggest game of his career to this point. Early first period, he looks sharp. Sheldon Kennedy gets a turnover, high slot shot, and Pauvin makes the big stop. No score through the first 5 minutes of the game. Maple Leafs score first. Doug Gilmore carrying the puck. It's Glenn Anderson who puts it in. His first goal of the series, and it is 1-0 Toronto. Red Wings even the score. Sergei Fedorov with the puck. Backhand pass to Paul Eisenbart. Eisenbart scores. Game's tied. Pauvin made 15 stops in the first period. Here's a big one right here. Watch the puck. Comes to Steve Yzerman in the slot. Yzerman waits, shoots. Pauvin, great glove hand stop, then covers in the rebound. Still 1-1 after one. Second period, Leafs try to take the lead. They're all over the net. Loose puck. Rob Pearson dives at it, hits it, but it catches Chevalier in the back, stays out, still tied at one. Wings do take the lead, though. Shot from the point, redirected by Sean Burr. No chance for Pauvin. Goes into the far side of the net, just inside the post. Red Wings take a 2-1 lead. Toronto pulls even. Bob Rouse scores his first goal of the playoffs. Rouse pinches in. That was Bob Rouse pinching in, scoring, tying the game at two. Less than 2 minutes later, Yves Racine will let the shot go. Pauvin makes the stop. He's out of position because Dallas Drake is there to pop it in. Again, not much chance for Pauvin. 3-2 Detroit. Maple Leafs have a great chance to tie the game. The puck all around the Wings crease. Nikolai Borshevsky hits Steve Chiasson, who made a great stop in a wide open net. 3-2 Wings after two. Late third period, Leafs buzzing again. Wendell Clark centers the puck off Chevalier's back. Doug Gilmore is there to put it in. and makes it 3-3. Cliff Fletcher is loving it from the press box upstairs. In overtime now, Doug Gilmore feeds Bob Rouse. Bob Rouse shot deflected by Nikolai Borishevsky, playing his first game after coming back from that injury. Great goal, and the Leafs win the series. Fletcher celebrating, Burns is celebrating, and Toronto Maple Leaf fans are celebrating as, yes, the Leafs have defeated the Detroit Red Wings in round one of the playoffs, but make the final score 4-3. It is all over. The Leafs win the series 4-3. Goal scorers for the Leafs: Anderson, Rouse, Gilmore, and Borishevsky. For Detroit, the goal scorers were Eisenbart, Burr, and Drake. The Toronto Maple Leafs will now go on to face the St. Louis Blues in the next round. The Blues quickly sweeping by the Chicago Blackhawks, and with that, Toronto, now a very tired team, will have to face a rested St. Louis Blues team. And now joining us live from Joe Louis Arena is Rod Smith. Rod, quite the game. Two games in this series go to overtime, and both games won by the Leafs. And it looks like, Rod, conditioning was a big factor.
I think conditioning was. I think there were other factors too, Gino. The fact that only one minor penalty was called tonight, one penalty period. And if you look at the Red Wings in this entire series, especially those blowout games, they really took advantage of the man advantage. They have an excellent power play, and they're excellent penalty killers, and Toronto's power play was ineffective. I think it was a big factor that the Leafs got so many even strength situations with the Red Wings, that even though the Wings are, I think, a more talented team, I think the Leafs basically outworked them.
And Rod, Teresa here. Also great to see players like Borishevsky coming back from that eye injury. Anderson, Rouse scoring their first goals of the playoff season. I guess the Leafs finally understanding that they can't always rely on Gilmore and Anderchuk if they're going to win in the playoffs.
Yeah, that's true, Teresa. And that kind of balance certainly helped them out tonight. And I think Nikolai Borishevsky may be an interesting sort of metaphor for the Toronto Maple Leafs, or a symbol, if you will. The fact that after game one he was hurt, and many thought, or it was announced really, that he would be out for this series and perhaps the entire playoffs. And I think the Leafs after one or two games were kind of written off too, but the Toronto Maple Leafs kept bouncing back. As you can well imagine, it was a very happy locker room afterwards.
This is the kind of hockey I love. I mean, say I guess I get off on it. I love this. That's the kind of hockey. I think it's great for hockey. It's great for the fans. It's great for everybody. In a Game 7 situation like that, whether we would have lost it or like we did win it, I think this is great.
Well, it's always terrible to take from our perspective. We go into Toronto and play as well as we did the other night. We come home and we didn't play with the energy that we had to.
Yeah, both teams were very gritty. Both teams came and played very, very hard hockey. I think our team and their team were very, if you look at the standings, they were 4 points ahead of us in the standings. So it was just two teams, they evenly matched, different styles, but made for a great series.
They played hard. I thought we played hard as well. We put ourselves in a position to throw everything in one game. In one game, who knows what, you know, a lot of funny things can happen in one game.
I've been involved with some different teams, and they've all been big wins at different times, but yeah, this is one of the biggest.
Very dejected Steve Yzerman in the Detroit Red Wings dressing room, very understandable, and of course the Leafs very elated. And Gino, you mentioned conditioning, and they won't have much time before the St. Louis Blues come to town. That will be game one on Monday night. But I think their momentum will certainly help them along the way. The Toronto Maple Leafs did not lose to the Blues, it's interesting to note, in the regular season, whereas they were totally even with Detroit. So maybe you'd give the advantage with home ice advantage and everything else, although we see home ice advantage wasn't a factor here. So it is the Maple Leafs moving on to the second round of the playoffs against St. Louis. And they would have, if they kept going, home ice advantage throughout the playoffs, at least through the Campbell Conference. So it's really unsure how far the Toronto Maple Leafs can go now. I know that they have just won one series and there's plenty to go, but they certainly showed a lot of heart and grit tonight against a team, as I say, as a lot of people say, had more talent.
At the Winston 500, Monday, 8 Eastern, and feel NASCAR thunder on Real TV TSN.
Ahead on Sports Desk, the Kings and Canucks collide in the Smythe Division Final. Canada gets their kicks at the expense of El Salvador. Barry Bonds pays big dividends for the Giants against the Expos. The Lakers hoping to watch the sun set in Phoenix. And Russia claims world supremacy.
Sports Desk, brought to you by Chevy Trucks. And by Gillette Sensor and the new Gillette Series. Gillette, the best a man can get.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Reddo. Nice to have you here. The playoffs, order of the day on the PGA Tour, in the NBA, and, of course, in the NHL as well. And that's where we begin. Divisional finals faced off on three different fronts on Sunday. To the Spice Division Finals, where we begin, Canucks and the Kings. Vancouver hasn't made it out of the division race, out of the division, rather, since 1982. While the Kings have never played a game in May in the history of their franchise. So both clubs trying to break into some new ground. The Canucks' objective is very clear. Play solid defense. Avoid getting into a shootout with the high-scoring Kings, because everyone knows that would be a battle that they would lose in a big hurry. The Canucks do strike first. Cliff Ronnie with the great pass. Dixon Ward beats Rob Stauber. The Kings were shorthanded. Canucks take a 1-0 lead. Then with the Kings on the offense, they even things up. Mike Donnelly jumps on loose puck, beats Kurt McLean. The game's all tied up at 1. With the Canucks up 2-1, Jurki Lehmä fires a low shot from the point. Jeff Cornell tips it by, and it's a 3-1 lead after 15 seconds left in the first period. Second period now, Kings on the power play. Warren Reichel, the great pass to Wayne Gretzky. He puts it in. The Canucks lead now just 3-2. Canucks pressure again, but Rob Stauber plays the aggressor. He nails Pavel Bure. Later in the second, Anatoly Semenov with a nice pass to Gerald Dittick. He gets it by Stauber. The Canucks take a commanding 4-2 lead, and they continue to build on that. Third period, Stauber makes the big stop, but Dave Babich comes in, and Babich puts it in. Vancouver takes a 1-0 lead in their best-of-seven series. They had a 3-goal lead. They won it by 3 goals. 5-2, the final score was Donnelly and Gretzky for the Kings for Vancouver. It was Ward, Merzen, Cortinel, Dittick, and Babich. Canucks outshot the Kings 42-27. Rob Stauber did a good job, but he faced an awful lot of rubber. David Pratt has more from Vancouver.
The Canucks knew going into Game 1 that they did not want to get into a shootout with the Los Angeles Kings. So the key for the Canucks was not offense, but rather defense.
You know, we worked hard on the our penalty killing, and even our power play was clicking pretty good. But overall, you know, 5-on-5, we did shut them down. You know, we can't give some of those guys. They got too much offensive power to give them much room, and, you know, obviously they'll get their chances. But not against us.
Whenever you play against your idol or whatever, with Wayne Gretzky, I've always idolized him. And it's good hockey. It's fast hockey. And myself, you know, if I can help the team in any way I can, I'm going to try and skate and use my speed, you know, to get the puck to my wingers. So we've been successful, but yet this next game's even bigger.
I think the good part of our game is the first few shifts we turned it over, and then we stopped doing it for a while, and we were able to get our own attack working, and we got some chances, a couple of power play goals that also helped a lot. We haven't been getting those, and so it gave us a little bit of cushion, and for the most part we did a reasonable job defensively.
The thing about the playoffs is there's extremely tremendous highs, and there's a tremendous lows, and what you have to do is you have to think about it, talk about it, regroup, come back for game two.
Strangely enough, for the Los Angeles Kings, offense is now a problem, because quite simply, going into game two, they know full well that goals are going to be just a little tougher to come by in this series. David Pratt, TSN, Vancouver.
Elsewhere, the Penguins heavily favored in their Patriot Division final with the New York Islanders, but being favored didn't seem to help the Hawks, Red Wings, Capitals, Nordiques, Flames, or Bruins in the first round. Both teams do have one thing in common, though, both concerned about their leading scores. Pierre Turgeon is out with a separated shoulder thanks to Dale Hunter. And now the Penguins are worried about the condition of Mario Lemieux. Only one shift in this game, then left with back spasms. More on that a little later on. First up, though, Troy Loney puts it out in front to Mike Needham. And it's 1-0 for the Penguins. The Islanders start to play some physical hockey. Darius Kasparaitis with a big hit on Jaromir Jagr. New York would tie it up. Vladimir Malikov crossed the line, blasts the rolling puck, beating Barrasso with a knuckleball. Game's tied at 1. Then, shorthanded, Ray Ferraro does it again. Ray Ferraro, his 9th playoff goal. Goes to the backhand, gives the Islanders a 2-1 lead. Second period now. Islanders again shorthanded. Benoit Hogue in front. One time the pass through Barrasso. New York with a surprising 3-1 lead at the igloo. And Glenn Healy, no surprise here. Great play as he stones Rick Tocchet from in close. The Pens cut the lead. Larry Murphy's shot from the point is redirected by Jeff Daniels. Pittsburgh back in it, trailing just 3-2. Then dying seconds of the game. Penguins circling the Islander net, but that's all they do is circle because they cannot beat Glenn Healy for the tying goal. So Al Arbor and the New York Islanders take a 1-0 series lead over the Pittsburgh Penguins with a big victory at the igloo. Malakoff, Ferraro is ninth, and Hogue for the Islanders. For Pittsburgh, it was Needham and Daniels. It is the first home loss for the Pittsburgh Penguins in playoffs action since May the 7th, 1992, when the Rangers were victorious at Pacific Arena. And incidentally, about Mario Lemieux, head coach Scotty Bowman expects that Mario Lemieux should be back in time for game number two of this series. On now to the Adams Division Final, the Sabres and the Canadiens, the series being billed as the Battle of Goaltenders. Grant Fuhr against Patrick Roy. A quick look at their lineups, and you realize that Buffalo has a lion's share of the snipers in this game. So you shouldn't be surprised to find out that the Canadians were outshot in this game 35-22. On hand for the game, former Vice President Brian O'Neill watching, and this is what he sees. One of the Canadians, and Alexander McGillie, turns, shoots, scores, beating Patrick Roy and tying the game at one. A few minutes later, Mike Keane gives it to Kurt Muller, and Muller will beat Grant Fuhr through the legs, and it's 2-1 Montreal after one. The game gets even more physical a little later on. Randy Muller gets hammered by Gilbert Dion in the glass. Second period, Paul DiPietro makes some terrific moves, goes in, beating Grant Fuhr with the backhand. Hits the post, rolls along the goal line. The referee says, yes, it is a goal, but it looked like it actually stayed on the goal line. Stood, though, 3-1 Montreal. But the Sabres come back. Dale Hawerchuk's first shot of stop, but by Keane, but a second shot goes in, 3-2 for the Canadians. Then a big scramble in front. The puck comes to Donald Audette. Watch Patrick Roy makes the first stop, and then Audette puts it upstairs to tie the game at 3-2. Some great goaltending in this game. Watch here as Patrick Roy stops Dale Hawerchuk from in close. Then Grant Fuhr kicks out the leg and robs Denny Savard right there. Third period action now. Watch Vincent Dampus, a great effort. He shakes off Ken Sutton's check, circles into the slot. Never should have been allowed to do this. Nice low drive, beating Grant Fuhr, 4-3 Montreal, time running down the third. Sabres with a terrific chance. The fast Alexander McGillie in front, but Roy kicks it out. Habs hang on to win game number one at the Forum. 4-3, they take a 1-0 series lead. Patrick Roy stopped 32 of the 35 Buffalo shots in this game. Mike Keane got three assists. For the goals, well, for Buffalo, it was McGillie, Hawerchuk. For Montreal, it was Brune, Muller, DiPietro, and Danfus. With more on game one of the Adams Division Final, here's Michael Whalen.
It wasn't a pretty victory, but it's one the Canadians will gladly take, and the key to the win was keeping the dynamic duo of Pat LaFontaine and Alexander McGillie mostly off the scoring sheet, and that job went to the checking line of John LeClair, Denny Savard, and Kirk Muller.
You know, they got that early one there, and a little nervous because once they get one, you know, they can get on a roll in that. But the big key, though, is, you know, the other guys coming up with big goals, and Paulie and Keener and those guys came up with big goals at big times. And, you know, when guys are scoring like that, then when you have a job like myself tonight to watch some offensive guys, you know, it makes it easy because you don't really think about trying to get the big goal or anything. It makes it easy on your part because you can play a little more conservative.
You know, they're tough to defense because they're so skillful, and you know, Patty LaFontaine is one of the premier players in the league, and McGillie has really had a great season this year, great playoffs so far, and so you know, Mays came through for them, played a good role. It's a good combination. They've got a guy that can work in the corner as a playmaker and a scorer.
Do you like this role?
Yeah, it's fine. As long as we win, that's the bottom line. Whatever I have to do to win, I'll do it.
It was a typical Adams Division game, I think, you know, tight checking. I think we can tighten up a little bit in our end, and, you know, just learn from there. You know, like I said, we didn't do anything special. We just, you know, worked hard to make sure McGillie and LaFontaine didn't pick up speed and you know, shut them down.
We know we can play better, and, you know, we hope we can bring it to game two, but I think, you know, we got to get just executing a little better, you know, making our passes crisper and on the tape. And times we were getting stalled up at times with poor plays and poor selections. And we got to get that back in game two.
It was the first loss in the playoffs for the Sabres, who claimed that the inactivity between the two series cost them on this night. Michael Whalen, TSN in Montreal.
All right, time for a quick break. When we come back, though, the road to World Cup 94 continues for Canada.
On TSN Sports Desk, it's a thriller at Maple Leaf Gardens to open the Norris Division final between Toronto and St. Louis. Despite his back, Mario vows he will be back, but the news isn't quite so good for Reggie Lewis of the NBA. The Northlands Coliseum will play hardball with Peter Pocklington, and Hal McRae swears you'll love the plays of the week.
Sports Desk, brought to you by Chevy Truck.
And hi again, everyone. Welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. A lot of things happening in baseball and in basketball on an active Monday night in sports. But before we get all that in, let us start with what happened in the Stanley Cup playoffs and Game 1 of the Norris Division Final. The Toronto Maple Leafs didn't have much time to savor their seventh game overtime win over the Red Wings Saturday night. Monday, they were back at it at Maple Leaf Gardens for Game 1 of their divisional final against the well-rested St. Louis Blues. The Blues, of course, had advanced in an upset sweep of the Blackhawks. They had been off for 8 days. Goaltending would be key for both teams. Curtis Joseph and Felix Potvin, both central figures in their team's success. And Game 1, exactly what we expected between these two teams. Low-scoring, tight-checking hockey. Leaf fans wearing blue but not feeling blue, enjoying this playing hockey in May. John Cullen gets the first goal, skates out of the corner untouched, makes the good move, loses the puck for a moment, but gets it back and slides it under Joseph, 1-0 Toronto. Second period, the Blues tie it on a nice one. Elton Emerson drops there for Denny Felsner. He finds Philippe Bozon in front. He tips it past Potvin, 1-1. Then it gets a little ugly. Jeff Brown catches Gilmore with a knee. Gilmore goes off in pain. Pat Burns is angry about that. He's demanding a penalty. Tempers flare a bit later in the corner. Glenn Anderson pitchforks Basil McRae right there, aiming for his throat. McRae deflects it, and Anderson has gone for the game with a misconduct. Lots of terrific goaltending in this one. Here's Dave Lowry in front, but look at right into the glove of Felix Potvin. In overtime, the scorer is Curtis Joseph. Doug Gilmore with a great move here on the defense, but Curtis Joseph is there. A little bit later in overtime, Doug Gilmore and Mike Foligno get good chances in close. There's Gilmore, and Foligno's chance is coming up right there. Again, Curtis Joseph with the great reflexes and everything they threw at him, he was able to turn away. Andrechuk had a chance in overtime. A scary moment coming up for the Blues. Foligno spinning in on goal, and his skate knocks Curtis Joseph's helmet flying. Joseph is stunned, and he has to go off for a little while, and they bring in Guy Hubert, and he's forced to make a big save right away on Nikolai Borshevsky, but he gets the toe out and keeps it scored at 1-1. Joseph comes in again, though, and he has faced over 60 shots, but Doug Gilmore fakes as if he's going this way. Joseph goes across. Gilmore wheels and wraps it around, and that is the overtime winner. A beautiful goal, a Gretzky-esque goal from Doug Gilmore, who logged an awful lot of ice time, and it was a fabulous game. Double overtime, and Gilmore scores the winner. The Leafs take the lead in the series. 2-1. Philippe Bozon for St. Louis, Cullen and Gilmore for the Toronto Maple Leafs, and TSN's Rod Smith was at the game and sends us this report.
In games this long and this important, it is inevitable heroes will emerge. For St. Louis, the hero once again was goaltender Curtis Joseph, who was absolutely sensational. He stopped 60 of 62 shots in a losing cause and only missed a few minutes of play, even though his jaw was sliced open accidentally by the skate of Mike Foligno. For Toronto, the hero, as usual, was Doug Gilmore, who logged more than 41 minutes of ice time and still came on in double overtime to score the winning goal.
Well, it was very important. They played a great game. Joseph played great again. This is one, and we got a long road ahead of us yet.
He was going around behind the net, and I thought he was going to stuff it on his forehand, and I went over there, and then I guess he went back the other way and was able to stuff it the other side.
Well, I mean, we knew that he's a competitor. I mean, anybody that can play as well as they did when they beat out Chicago, And then come after a few days off and play as well as he did tonight. He's definitely a competitor.
It was a 1-1 game, so every time he made a save, I had to not give a goal. So, of course, I mean, the better he play, I just don't want to give one more goal than him, and that's the way it turned around tonight.
Obviously, we can do more in aspects of our game. Can't give up 60 shots, but... I mean, 2-1 in double overtime, I mean, it's hard to swallow, but it's also, it's a sign that you're in it the whole way.
It would have been a real hard loss on us because it would have put us back in a certain position, and, you know, I think winning this game gives us a bit of momentum.
This series is expected to be low scoring. So far, it has been. This series is expected to have great goaltending. So far, it has. This series is expected to be dull. 2 out of 3 ain't bad. Rod Smith, TSN, in Toronto.
All right, thank you, Rod. How about other series? Are the Pittsburgh Penguins a one-man team? No. They do have Kevin Stevens, Jaromir Jagr, Rick Tocchet, Ron Francis, Joe Mullen. Steady defense and good goaltending, but the fact is the Penguins do not do as well without Mario. The Penguins superstar played just one shift on Sunday against the Islanders before leaving the game with back spasms, and as a result, Pittsburgh lost Game 1. Mario and the Penguins and their fans hopeful that the back will allow him to be back for Game 2.
It was the same pain when I went out for a few weeks, and you know, it just comes on after a few months, and then once it starts, it's a big problem. But you know, hopefully I can get through this next 2 months, and then you know, talk to the doctors and see what we can do.
More surgery planned? Is it possible?
It's always possible. You know, it's always a possibility. We've been talking with the doctors that after the season we might have to go in again, but it's really a minor surgery. It's only on the surface. It wouldn't be in the muscle. It would be around the fascia area, which is a minor surgery, but it would only take maybe 10 minutes to repair it. So hopefully that's the only problem that I have back there.
So if Mario Lemieux is back, then the Pittsburgh Penguins might look like a different
team. Get it all today on Real TV, TSN.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, the Canadians look to hold back a stampeding Buffalo Sabres. Mario's a scratch again, and the rest of the Penguins look to pick up the slack. Hunter has become the hunted, and the NHL has caught him and fined him. The Expos take a walker on the wild side against San Diego, and will the sun set on Phoenix?
Sports Desk, brought to you by Gillette Sensor and the new Gillette Series. Gillette, the best a man can get.
Welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor, and Tuesday night was a crazy one in sports. A couple of hockey playoff games, 4 basketball playoff games, and a ton of baseball. And we want to get you right up to date, so let's get right to it, beginning with the Stanley Cup playoffs. The Montreal Canadiens took Game 1 of the Adams Final because the Buffalo Sabres from Round 1 just didn't show up. Grant Fuhr was not sharp in goal, and the Sabres' money man, Pat LaFontaine, didn't have a good game. Game 2, the Sabres promised, would be different. The Habs kind of liked the way things went, though, in Game 1, and they were looking to jump up a couple of games in this series before they had to head back to Buffalo. Montreal gets a goal early, 2 minutes in. Bad clearing by Doug Bodger. Vince Danfoos grabs it and wraps it around and beats Fuhr 1-0 on the gift from the Sabres. 30 seconds later, a return gift as Patrick Waugh misplays a Ken Sutton slapper, and it's 1-1. Some big hits in this game. Look at Donald Dufresne giving it to Randy Wood against the glass, and he cuts Randy Wood. Second period, 2-1 Buffalo. Habs tie it up on the power play here. Kirk Muller digs it out of a scrum, turns, and zings one right to the short side past Grant Fuhr. Second power play goal for Montreal, 2-2. In the third, 3-2 Montreal. Sabres convert on their chance. A shot from Bodger from the point. Patrick Waugh says he was interfered with, but the ref doesn't buy it. So they go to overtime, 3-3. Ed Ronan hustles, out-hustles the defenseman Carney to save it from being an icing call. Denny Savard picks up the loose puck, pops it out to Guy Carboneau. Carboneau pops it in, and 4-3 Montreal in overtime. The Canadiens win their 6th straight playoff game. Carboneau with the winner, the overtime winner. Danfoos had a pair. Kirk Muller had the other one. LaFontaine, Bodger, and Sutton for Buffalo. And TSN's Michael Whalen has this report from Montreal.
They say it's the little things that'll win you a game in playoff hockey, and tonight, Ed Ronan beat an icing call, got the puck over to Denny Savard, who in turn got it to Guy Carboneau, who flipped it in to win this game for the Montreal Canadiens. It was Carboneau's first goal since the month of November.
You're always trying to help the team as much as you can, but you know, I had a lot of chance tonight. I had a lot of chance during the other match, the other game too, but the puck didn't want to go in, or the goalie was always making good saves. And to be able to just not just score, but help the team win in overtime, it's a good feeling.
You never know. I mean, you got to go all out every shift, and you hope for the best, and usually hard work pays off in a goal, and you know, we got the dividends tonight with that play.
This is a team thing, and whether you go out there for four shifts or 10 shifts, you've got to do everything you can to help your teammates. And you know, I think we've done that over the playoffs. The guys that haven't played much, they've contributed in some big way sometimes.
We played pretty good, but it takes more than pretty good to win a game here in this league. We have to be the top of our game. Can't afford any lapses. And we got to get to every loose puck. We got to get to icings. And they wanted it, just a little bit more than we did tonight. And we're hoping we can take it back and get the fans behind us back in Buffalo and rally.
The Canadians were so effective in nullifying the McGillney-LaFontaine combination that by the middle of the second period, John Muckler had them on second lines. Of course, that situation will change when the teams go back to Buffalo, where Muckler will have the last say on line changes. Michael Whalen, TSN in Montreal.
So Montreal up a couple of games. Monday, Mario Lemieux told us he would be back for game two of the Penguins-Islanders series. The Islanders had won the first game. Mario said the back was feeling good Monday and a massage had helped quite a bit, but he tried it out Tuesday afternoon in the afternoon skate and found the back was still troubling him. So Mario sat out again on Tuesday night as the Penguins hosted the Isles in game two of this Patrick Division final series. There's Mario taking the game in from the press box. First period, the Pens get on the board though. Mike Ramsey with a great cross-ice pass spots Joe Mullen over there. Mullen just redirects it from a bad angle, beats Healy, 1-0 Pens. Darius Kasparaitis with a great check on Joe Mullen next, and Mullen falls into the boards because the gate comes open and into the bench. Some of the hits, though, in this game, not too legal. Top of your screen, we'll highlight it for you. Steve Thomas gives it to Ulf Samuelsson right in the face, and Samuelsson is left bleeding, and Steve Thomas gone for the game, and that's a costly loss for the Islanders because in the third period, still 1-0 Penguins. They add to their lead. Jaromir Jagr with the good stick handling here. He takes the shot. Healy will make the save. But Rick Tocchet crashing the crease, sweeps in the rebound. 2-0 Pens. And the Pens eventually put it away with a third goal as Kevin Stevens steams down the left wing. Lets a big blast go. Healy stops that. Ron Francis, though, slides the rebound between the legs. 3-0 Pittsburgh. And those puckheads in Pittsburgh are going home happy because their team has tied the series at one game apiece. Goal scorers Joe Mullen, Rick Tocchet, and Ron Francis. Barrasso stopping 26 shots for his second shutout of the 1993 playoffs. Still with hockey news, Dale Hunter got what many hockey fans said he had coming. That was a harsh suspension from the NHL front office. Hunter for that cheap shot, which left the Islanders' Pierre Turgeon with a separated shoulder, will get 21 games next season. That's a big suspension, one quarter of the schedule, and he will also lose $150,000 in salary. It's the stiffest suspension ever for an on-ice incident.
The incident involving Dale Hunter and Pierre Turgeon needed to be severely punished, and we think by suspending the player immediately and continuing that suspension in effect through the entire training camp and preseason, through the 21st game of the regular season, that we've sent a loud message out that we're not going to tolerate this type of conduct and that the player has been severely punished.
What was a very harsh suspension. The league has had a long history of discipline and various and different types of suspensions, and this one has been the harshest of all actions that have taken place in the National Hockey League. And you know, to me, I think it was a little unfair. I think the Dale Hunter and the Capitals were at the wrong place at the wrong time, meaning that it was in New York City and the Commissioner of the League was in attendance at the game.
The main thing is I'm not on the ice, and I would love to be out there to be a part of but be a part of the players and up there and play against Pittsburgh, and that's something that I can't do, and I'm really mad about that. That's true.
I believe it is a severe penalty. The loss in pay to this player will amount to more than all of the supplemental discipline handed out to all NHL players for the 92-93 season. If this isn't a severe penalty, then I apologize, but I'm not sure.
Right here on Real TV, TSA.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, Pavel Bure scores one of many between the Kings and the Canucks. While in Toronto, the goalies were preventing them until they were blue in the face. This Walker's a runner as the Expos try to beat the Padres. Monica Seles talks about the stabbing incident from last week, and Charlotte tries to punch out the Celtics.
Is brought to you by Makita Canada Incorporated, Canada's leading manufacturer of professional power tools.
Hi, everyone. Welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor, and glad you're with us for the next half hour as we run down the news stories of a busy Wednesday. And let's get it going right away with the Stanley Cup playoffs. Action on Wednesday was in the Campbell Conference. When the Los Angeles Kings ended their Smythe Division semifinal against the Flames, head coach Barry Melrose was touting the effectiveness of his run-and-shoot Kings offense. But the Kings weren't going up against Kirk McLean in that series, and gunning it out with the Canucks in Game 1 didn't work. The Canucks won it 5-2. The Kings must have figured it was time to stiffen up the D, and Wednesday they tried Kelly Rudy in goal. And let's take you to the Pacific Coliseum as Kelly Rudy gets his first start since Game 1 of the Calgary series. Doesn't get off to a good start, though. Greg Adams out in front gets a couple of whacks at it, and his goal number 6 in the playoffs for Adams, and that ties the game at 1. Then Wayne Gretzky takes over. Watch this beautiful feather pass over to his old buddy, Yari Curry, and Curry zings it in past Kirk McLean, 2-1 L.A. L.A. goes up by a couple. Gretzky setting up Warren Reichel here. Here's the drop pass, and there's the blast from Warren Reichel, and it is 3-2 Kings after 1. Second period, Kings up by 2. Look at this effort by Pavel Bure as he spins and fires, and Kelly Rudy should have had that one. 4-3, Kings ahead. Just before the second period ends, Luke Robitaille, nice backhand pass. Gretzky on the doorstep, slides it home. Kings led 5-3 after two periods. Third period, Marty McSorley over to Thomas Sandstrom. He passes to Conacher in front. Conacher redirects, and the Kings even the series at one game apiece with a 6-3 victory in Vancouver. Mark Hardy, Yari Curry, Reichel, Granato, Gretzky, and Pat Conacher do the scoring for L.A. Adams, Dixon Ward, and Pavel Bure for Vancouver. Gretzky had a great game, a three-point night to help tie the series, and TSN's David Pratt was there.
Before Game 2, the Kings openly talked about how they had to increase their level of intensity. Well, as it turned out, Wayne Gretzky chose to lead by example.
Well, we were just ready from the get-go. I don't think there's any question that, you know, we talk about if we lose and we get beat fair and square by our work ethic and the team's beating us fair and square, then we'll tip our hats. But when we get beat the way we did on Sunday, we don't think we gave a gritty effort at all. Then it's disappointing and frustrating. We played hard tonight, and like I said, it's not a big secret.
But he's also another type of leader. People don't know that he's a pretty vocal guy, and he's very intense. When he's playing like that, he elevates everyone else's game. He's done that in Edmonton. He's done it in L.A. with guys. As I said, I feel lucky that I've had a chance. One of the things that intrigued me about coming to L.A. was working with him, and I enjoy every minute seeing that guy play. He's phenomenal.
Well, the good thing about it is tomorrow we start over, and it's a new day, so we just got to get back to playing our style of hockey. We got to be we're a disciplined team, and when we play that way, we're successful, and we got to get back to that.
So now the Los Angeles Kings head home knowing that this is now a best-of-five affair, and they have home ice advantage. David Pratt, TSN, Vancouver.
All right, thank you, David. Glenn Anderson of the Maple Leafs tried to spear St. Louis winger Basil McRae in the face or throat area in Game 1 of the Norris Division Final. McRae had mashed Anderson in the boards, and he was angry. Anderson got 5 in a game, but the NHL disciplinary people had a hearing in Toronto before Game 2, and they were deliberating right up until game time, deciding whether Anderson would play. As it turns out, they decided that he could play and wouldn't be suspended. So the Leafs and the Blues, who went into double overtime Monday, got together for what became another grueling battle in Game number 2 in Toronto. Let's take you there, as Curtis Joseph, the hero in Game 1 with over 60 saves, picks up where he left off. Opening minutes, he stops Wendell Clark, and then Peter Zezel on the rebound. Still no score, even though the Leafs are outshooting the Blues 13-1 at this point. 8.5 minutes into the period, Craig Janney will fight off Jamie McCowan, feed it across, and Brett Hull redirects. Beautiful goal, beating Felix Potvin, 1-0 Blues. Midway through the period, though, the Leafs on the power play. Doug Gilmore takes it off the skate, stuffs it under Curtis Joseph, and yeah, that did trickle in. They disputed it for a while, but that was the goal, and it tied it at one. Stayed that way through third. Time running out, regulation. Bill Berg had a chance to win it, but he couldn't put it past Joseph. 10 minutes into overtime, Wendell Clark with a shot, and the puck lies in the crease. But the Blues steer it away, and it doesn't go in. Last minute of the first extra period, Brett Hull tries to win it right here with a quick release. One of those quick shots he's patented for, but the glove save by Felix Potvin. Still tied at one. On they go to a second overtime period for the second straight time. This time, though, the Blues prevail. A big rebound there for Jeff Brown, and he stuffs it in a second overtime period. The Blues steal a split in Toronto, taking game two, 2-1 in the second overtime period. Once again, Curtis Joseph, a great game, 57 saves, gives him 118 saves in the two games so far in this series. Brett Hull and Jeff Brown with the winner. Doug Gilmore replying for the Toronto Maple Leafs, the 17th overtime game in this playoff year. More now from TSN's Rod Smith.
Game two was just about a carbon copy of game number one. Same final score, decided at just about the same time of double overtime. Same outstanding goaltending, especially by Curtis Joseph, who turned away shot after shot by Toronto. The only thing different, much to the relief of the Blues, was the winner.
I'm just trying to do whatever it takes to help this team, and fortunately, the puck's staying out, and the guys buried one for me tonight, and I'm ecstatic about that.
We've had tons of shots on him, and he's come up big for them, and I think that if he's not the first star, I don't know who is, but he's definitely making some great saves at the right time.
And he was spectacular again and kept us in the game. I think after the first period, we generated some offense and at least started to put some pressure on him. And after that, he still made great saves. The kid the other end made some great saves too.
Joseph was good. He said, what can you do? He's just phenomenal. We're going to have to find a way to get it by him.
CJ's line's been carrying us all year, and I just went up to him and I said, listen, guys, this is it. This is where you guys shine. And go to the net and I'll be coming behind. And sure enough, they went in and they all, crowded the net, and their whole team collapsed, and I just found an opening, and luckily the puck just sat there for me. And we had a lot of chances early in second overtime, and we just couldn't get it upstairs. And we'd been talking about it, and fortunately I got it up and over Felix.
It should be noted that Felix Potvin had another great night in the Toronto goal. He faced 40 shots and made 38 saves, many of them outstanding. But on a night when Curtis Joseph played the way he did, 38 saves was not enough. Rod Smith, TSN, in Toronto.
Coming up on Sports Desk, this the Sabres don't need as they try to harness the Canadiens. A rude welcome back for Mario Lemieux by the Islanders. The Jays play long ball trying to subdue the Orioles. Reggie Miller pacing Indiana's attempt to tie the Knicks. And optimism is the key word for Canada's national soccer team.
Sports Desk. Brought to you by Gillette Sensor and the new Gillette Series. Gillette, the best a man can get. And by Makita Canada Incorporated, Canada's leading manufacturer of professional power tools.
Hi, everybody. Just great to welcome you to the show. As always, I'm Michael Landsberg. And I'm Brendan Connor. Also ahead on TSN Sports Desk, the Knicks and the Jazz try to finish off their opponents in the NBA playoffs while the Suns fight frantically to stay alive.
That's a terrific series. Plus all of the baseball highlights, including the Jays versus the Orioles and Clements versus the Athletics, the only team that he seems to struggle with.
Right now, though, we're going to get it going with the NHL in game number three of the Adams Final. Michael?
After two games of the Adams Final, did you get the feeling that the Sabres thought that their upset of the Bruins was more than enough for the year? A couple of flat, uninspired games, and Buffalo's much-awaited playoff success seemed to be a postseason blip. Down 2-0 to the Canadiens, the Sabres had to get up for Game 3 at the odd and start playing the kind of hockey that allowed them to beat the hottest team in the league in round number one.
And Jacques Demers knows that if his team can get off to a fast start, they'll be in great shape. And boy, is it ever a fast start. 14 seconds in, Kirk Muller with a shot from the circle. Grant Fuhr has not been terrific in this series, and he's not terrific here. 1-0 for Montreal. Later on in the first, Brian Bellis with a cross-ice pass to Vincent Domfus. Domfus with the empty net, kind of like the feed he got from Savard in game number two. And Muckler has got to try to fire up his troops and get them to play some physical hockey. And they do. LaFontaine rips into Mike Keane on the boards. And then Ken Sutton nails Eric Desjardins with a big hit. Meanwhile, Patrice Brisbois gets hit a couple of times behind the net. Second period, a scary moment for the Sabres. Alexander McGillney's right leg folds up underneath him, and he was taken immediately to hospital. He is in excruciating pain, and the way his ankle was bent on that play, you can understand exactly why. We'll try to find out what the diagnosis is of his injury before we're done tonight. Sabres get on the board. LaFontaine to Bob Airey. His backhand shot beats Patrick Waugh. Waugh down. I don't think he ever saw it, and it is a 2-1 hockey game. Then the Sabres tie it. Doug Bodger leans into one from the point. Once again, Waugh hardly moved at all, and it's tied at 2. Third period, the Canadians took a 3-2 lead. Then loose puck for Dale Howardchuk. One chance, and then another. He gets it back off his skate, gets a couple of whacks, and scores. We're tied at 3. Go into overtime. In Buffalo, Sabres desperate for a win here. Patrice Brisbois with a point shot through traffic. Gilbert Dion with a tip. Dion with a tip. He points. He says, me. It's me. It's me. And that's what the official score agreed with. Final score is Jacques Demers, and the boys can smile. 4-3, Montreal over Buffalo. Canadians now hold a stranglehold in the series. They lead it 3-0. Goal scorers, Muller with his 6th, Domfus with his 7th. He's red hot right now. Carbonneau with his 2nd, and Dion with his 4th. A huge one in overtime. For Buffalo, Sutton with the 2nd, Bodger with the 2nd, and Howardchuk with his 4th. Habs have now won 7 great games. We showed you the goals that beat Waugh, but he was sharp otherwise, making 33 saves. Final score, Montreal 4 and Buffalo 3. Meantime, the Pittsburgh Penguins aren't usually proponents of the waiting game. They like to go right at things, but tonight they were forced to wait until moments before the game to see if Mario Lemieux's back would allow him to play. The Penguins, of course, tied 1-1 with the New York Islanders in the Patrick final as the teams moved to the Nassau County Coliseum for game number 3. As it turned out, Mario was okay to play, but started the game on the bench. Got his test early on, though, as Delgarno runs into him and his own guy, Kevin Stevens, runs over him. He was okay, though. The back stood up. Then Mario got a great scoring chance early. 2-on-1 shorthanded. Larry Murphy, Mario's shot, kicked out by Glenn Healy. Big save. The Islanders also get a big scoring chance. Ray Ferraro again in alone, but he loses control of the puck after losing Ferraro on the fake. A little bit later, Pittsburgh opens the scoring. Jeff Daniels shot, stopped by Healy. Ron Francis bangs in the rebound. Penguins up 1-0. Then Jaromir Jagr in with a shot. There's one shot. Healy makes a save. Jagr falling down, sweeps the backhander in on the rebound. 2-0 Pittsburgh. Second period, the Islanders get it back. On the power play, Malakoff with a shot from the point. Rebound for Ray Ferraro, number 10 on the playoff season. He leads playoff goal scorers. New York down 2-1. Ferraro then shuts the door on the Isles. He makes a first save there and then robs Delgarno on the rebound. Pens up 2-1. Mario passes to Joey Mullen, who is being hauled down, but shovels it into the empty net. The Penguins win this one. 3-1 the final, and they take a 2-1 lead in the series. Ron Francis, Jaromir Jagr, and Joe Mullen with goals. Joe Mullen's empty netter actually gives him 58 for the career in the playoffs. Most ever by an American-born player. Ray Ferraro replied for the Isles, his 10th. Tom Barrasso, 36 saves. And the Penguins, with Mario back in it, take the lead in that series.
In your game, come rain or shine. Today, on Real TV, TSN.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, the great one is still great, as the Vancouver Canucks are finding out. The Blues and the Leafs, a bit more scoring, but still a one-goal difference. Last-inning heroics help the Blue Jays silence the Orioles. Chris Nabholz scuttles the Pirates in Pittsburgh, and happiness reigns in the Alamo City.
Sports Desk. Brought to you by Wiser Lock, Canada's first choice in lock security.
Hi there, everyone, and welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor, and we have lots of business to attend to as usual, covering the events of Friday evening, so not much time to waste, and we're going to get going with a couple of big games in the Stanley Cup playoffs off the top. Wednesday night, the Los Angeles Kings won in Vancouver, tying the Smythe final at one game apiece. And the Kings head coach Barry Melrose guessed right by putting Kelly Rudy back in goal. So Friday in Game 3, the Canucks were facing a confident goaltender, a red-hot Wayne Gretzky, and a Kings team that can fill the net if allowed a little bit of skating room. Let's take you to the Great West Forum, and Kelly Rudy gets the call again, leading the boys out on the ice. And hey, some fans from Vancouver made it down to L.A. for this one. No scoring till the second period. Kings with the man advantage. Daryl Sador in from the point to scoop up a loose puck. Goes up high, 1-0 L.A. But the Canucks come right back. Trevor Linden behind the net, out front to Jeff Courtnell. Quick move to the back end, underneath Rudy, and it's a tie, 1-1. Still in the second, 2-1 Vancouver. Follow the bouncing puck. Gretzky off a defenseman, off one of his own men, off another Canucks defenseman, into the net. Warren Reichel gets credit. 2-2 tie. Move to the third. Alexei Zitnik shot from the point. Puck comes to Robitaille and then goes in off Doug Lidster's skate right there. Trickles over the line. Another fluky one. The Kings lead 3-2. A few minutes later, no fluke about this one. Look at Curry blowing by Didick and going upstairs on McLean. Lovely goal from Yari Curry, 4-2 Kings lead. A little bit later, Gretzky and Sandstrom, 2-on-1, tries the pass, it is blocked, and back it comes to Gretzky, and he says, thank you, tucks it in. 100 playoff goals in the career, 5-2 LA. The great one adds an empty netter, and the Kings win this one 7-4. Quite an offensive show. They take a 2-1 lead. Wayne Gretzky with a couple. Daryl Sador, Warren Reichel with his fifth goal of the playoffs. Luke Robitaille, Yari Curry, and Thomas Sandstrom. Courtnell, Semenoff, Babich, and Mimeso for Vancouver. More now from TSN, David Pratt.
The story of this game has been the story of this series, Wayne Gretzky. Gretzky not only has given the Kings a 2-1 lead in the series, but also becomes the first player in the history of the NHL to score 100 goals in the playoffs.
Anytime you reach a milestone, it's always exciting, but I think that they don't really mean a whole lot unless you win. And it really makes it extra special when it's a big goal. And I thought at that point in time, the game, the fifth goal was a big goal for us, 4-2, a lot of time left. And we went up 5-2, and as it turned out, it was a big goal. I was pretty happy about it.
You can't give him that kind of space. And he's a great player, and he's going to hurt you if you give him time and space. So we're going to talk about some things, how to correct that. And he's a great player. He played well again tonight.
It feels good, you know. I'm sure we'll enjoy it for one day, then we have to throw things out, and, you know, tomorrow's a different day, and we respect Vancouver Canucks. They have a very good hockey club, and we have to come out Sunday and take advantage of our home ice.
Game 4 goes here Sunday at the Great Western Forum, and the Canucks know that unless they can find an answer to Wayne Gretzky, this series could be over in a hurry. David Pratt, TSN, Los Angeles.
Over in the Norris Finals, the scene switched to the St. Louis Arena for Games 3 and 4 between the Blues and the Maple Leafs. And the consensus in both cities, St. Louis goaltender Curtis Joseph cannot stay as hot as he has been in the postseason. And Friday's game was supposed to produce a higher score, but which team would score higher remained anybody's guess. Let's take a look at what happened. Curtis Joseph trying to work that magic again on the Leafs. Leafs get to him early, though, for a change. Anderson out to Andrychuk, who beats Joseph in the first period. Leafs have a 1-0 lead. Felix Potvin, meantime, at the other end, very sharp. Good save in close from Kelly Miller right there, Kevin Miller. Craig Jenny gets caught with his head down here, and Dave Ellett puts the shoulder into him. Good open ice playoff hit. Later in the first, on the power play, Doug Gilmore feathers a lovely pass over to Ellett, cruising in from the point. He redirects. It's in. The Leafs have a 2-0 lead, and Cliff Fletcher, the Leafs general manager and president, is enjoying this one. Yeah, he says, all right. Meantime, Ron Caron, the head of the Blues up there, scratching his head, wondering what's wrong. Seconds later, Felix Potvin stops Jeff Brown, but Brett Hull pounces on the rebound and cuts the Leafs' lead to 2-1. St. Louis back in this one in a hurry. Second period, Shanahan lets one go quickly, beats Potvin between the legs, and it's 2-2. Leafs with a great chance here. Gilmore on a breakaway, but look at the glove save by Curtis Joseph. Still 2-2. St. Louis dominates the second. Potvin stops Denny Feltner, but Shanahan there to jam in his second of the period, and the Blues take the lead 3-2. Three straight goals, and it's into the third period now. Mike Krushelnicki of the Leafs is stopped, but Glenn Anderson, who has been playing a pretty good game, cruises in from behind the net, stuffs it in under Joseph, and ties the game at 3. Later, Jamie McCown will miss a check. Rich Sutter finds a charging Garth Butcher. Garth Butcher, not a goal scorer, but steps up into the play here. Nice pass, and Butcher just tips it in high. St. Louis up 4-3. Time running down. The Leafs pressing for the tie. They're all over the Blues, but they cannot put it in. The Leafs have a bunch of chances as the second stick off, but they lose this one after being up 2-0. They go down by a score of 4-3. Curtis Joseph once again, very solid. Not magical, but very solid with 34 saves. Goal scorers here, Shanahan with a pair.
Down. 4-2. Cool.
Later, dude.
Coming up on Sports Desk, the Canadians go after the Adams Division title at the Sabres' expense. Mario Lemieux is an almost no-show, and the Islanders try to take advantage. Runs galore as the Pirates take on the Expos at Three Rivers. The Jazz eliminated by a sonic boom. And Canada trying to take the final step to World Cup 94. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Retta. It is so nice to have you with us. The Jays counting on another young pitcher as they face the Baltimore Orioles at Skydome. Lennox Lewis puts his belt on the line in Las Vegas, but first to the NHL, where the Sabres are trying to stay alive in this year's NHL playoffs. Montreal Canadiens looking for their eighth straight win in the playoffs. With it, it would send their second team into the offseason. The Canadiens eliminated Quebec by winning four in a row after losing the first two of the series. And Saturday night, the Habs were a win away from sweeping the Sabres out of the playoffs as well. Check into the highlights for you. Jacques Demers, very clear in his mind what has to be done. But the Sabres get the jump on the Habs. Matthew Barnaby with a nice pass to Ken Sutton. Makes it 1-0 Buffalo as Patrick Roy did not see it. Habs tied up later on. Paul DiPietro to Lyle Oderline. Now watch the patience of Oderline. Waits, pulls Fuhr out, then puts the puck at one after one. Montreal takes the lead in the second. Vincent Domfus, working from behind the net, actually puts this in off of Grand Fuhr into the net. 2-1, Montreal. Sabres trying hard to get back into the game. Big, hard hit here by Bob Airey. They have had their lead in the power play. Brian Bello spins to Dion, to Kevin Holler, to the back of the net. 3-1, Montreal. They are in command. Buffalo in peril of being ousted. The Sabres do come to life in the third, though. First, it's Grand Fuhr. Big glove hand stop here on Brian Bellows. Then Brad May with a big hit on Sean Hill. May comes out of nowhere and nails Hill behind the net. Then with Buffalo on the power play, Dale Hawerchuk off the faceoff circle, waits, then lets it go, beating Patrick Roy, and Buffalo within one goal, desperately trying to stay alive. Then less than a minute to go, Doug Bodger and Guy Carboneau involved in a big collision. They get hit hard. Both of them feel it. They're both down the ice for a while, but they are both okay. Then, less than 10 seconds left to go, it's Randy Wood out to Yuri Himalev, and Himalev bangs it in with 9.2 seconds left in their season. The Sabres tied it up and stayed alive a little longer. 11:37 of overtime. Kurt Muller takes the feed and takes the shot, beating Grand Fuhr just inside the far post. With that, it's over. The Sabres swept out of the playoffs. Montreal Canadiens win their eighth straight playoff game. This one in overtime over the Buffalo Sabres. 4-3, the final score. It was Oderline, Domfus, Holler, and Muller for Montreal. For Buffalo, Sutton, Hawerchuk, and Himalev. Canadiens win the series four straight. All four games finished 4-3. They say the Habs won their eighth in a row on the night. Patrick Roy made 37 saves on this night. And our very own Michael Whelan was at the odd and has this post-game report for us.
It was the fourth game in a row to end up with the identical score of 4-3, and it was a gritty performance made by the Buffalo Sabres as they fought back from a 3-1 deficit to tie the game in the third period. The Canadians seemed to be playing conservatively for most of that period, but in the overtime, they got the goal that counted.
We talked about going to the net a little more and try to get a few more shots, and Johnny Eclair made the play. You know, he busted to the net and opened everything up for him, or opened everything up for me. So I was able to take my time and get a shot away. And
what was the feeling for you?
Just totally relieved. You know, they came out really strong in this game. Showed a lot of character playing with LaFontaine and McGillney. And, you know, in overtime, they put in a lot of pressure on us. So we were real happy to win.
See, the Sabres fought back, and you have to give them a lot of credit. It's not always easy to play a hockey game when it's 3-0 in the series. And, you know, they did. They fought back, and a lot of respect to them.
They're a good hockey team and everything, but you know, we've played them both the last two games, and you know, I guess just the idea there, they're a winning hockey club, and you know, they know how to win, and they got a lot of veterans, and Patrick Roy was, you know, I don't know, he was outstanding because he made big saves when he needed to.
That's always disappointing to lose. I mean, nobody enjoys losing, so everybody wished we would have gone a little bit further, but it just wasn't to be.
I have a lot of admiration for John Buckler. I think he's one of the great coach. He made me work harder than I have to work because he always keeps you on your toes. And when you coach against John Meckler, you become a better coach.
So it's off to the Wales Conference Finals for the Montreal Canadiens, who could use the rest right now as they await the winners of the Islanders-Pittsburgh series. They've got a lot of banged-up players. Michael Whalen, TSN in Buffalo, New York.
Thanks, Michael. And we check in with that series now. Game 4 of the Patrick Division Final in Long Island. With all the Penguins' firepower, Tom Barrasso has been somewhat overshadowed recently. He's quietly backstopped his team to a 2-1 series lead thanks to back-to-back victories while just giving up one goal in his last 7 periods. Instead of Barrasso, much of the attention has surrounded Mario Lemieux, and no surprise, his back problems have flared up once again. He couldn't even tie his own skates before Saturday night's game. He did get in uniform, didn't see his first shift until midway through the first period, and even then, only played on the power play for the Penguins. Tom Barrasso played throughout the night and had a terrific performance. Big save here on Derek King. No score in the game to this point. Series continues to be physical. Tom Fitzgerald with a nice hit on Ulf Samuelson into the boards. Later in the period, Barrasso comes up with a big save again. This time, Steve Thomas robbed of a sure goal. No score after one period. Scary moment in the second. Jeff Daniels and Brad Delgarno run into each other. Delgarno gets his leg caught underneath Daniels, shaken up, but was fortunately able to stay in the game. Later in the period, Jaromir Jagr steals the puck in Islander territory, makes him pay for it as he beats Healy, and it's 1-0 for the Penguins. Go to the second period now. Ray Ferraro tries to puck, and as he does, it actually goes off Larry Murphy's stick and into his own net. Big trouble. Score side at 1. With the Isles playing shorthanded now, Fitzgerald intercepts the Penguins zone, beats Barrasso, and it's 2-1 New York. Third period, both teams come out sharp as a skate. Fitzgerald 2-on-1. Let's the shot go, beats Barrasso, and it's 3-1 for the Islanders. They are in control. Score 3-2 when Rick Tocchet finds the equalizer. In front of the crease, puts it in, 3-all tie. Then Dennis Vasky is stopped by Barrasso. Derek King there for the rebound, gives New York a 4-3 lead. Lemieux then from behind the net puts it out to Kevin Stevens. He puts it in, ties the score at 4. Then we're tied at 5. When Ray Ferraro slides it across to King, King puts it in the go-ahead goal. Ultimately, the winning goal as Pittsburgh falls to the New York Islanders on Long Island. 6-5, the final score. For Pittsburgh, it was Jagr, Loney, Tocchet, Stevens, and Francis. For the Islanders, it was Fitzgerald with 2, King with 2, Ferraro and Vladimir Malikov brought up the score for the Islanders. They now tie the series at 2 games apiece. Tom Fitzgerald becomes just the 7th player in NHL history to score 2 shorthanded goals in a playoff game. And 2 very important
goals. He's on the PGA Tour, and we'll have more instruction from David Ledbetter. That's Golf Today on Real TV, TSN.
On Sports Desk, the Canucks try to shine in Tinseltown against the Kings, while the Cats scratches St. Louis until they're blue in the face. Canada hopes to ascend to the World Cup Finals by beating Mexico, while Phoenix hopes the Suns will rise again with a come-from-behind win against the Lakers. And the Blue Jays go down the Duane.
Desk, brought to you by Chevy Trucks and by Gillette Sensor and the new Gillette series. Gillette, the best a man can get.
Hi everyone and welcome to Sports Desk. I'm Gino Retta. Nice to have you here. Great day for members at the LPGA Sara Lee Classic. We'll also check in on the Spanish Grand Prix, but first to the NHL playoffs, and we begin with the Smythe Division Final. And what a difference Game 4 could make in this series. The Kings win, and they would be at the precipice of getting out of the second round of the playoffs for the first time in franchise history. A Canucks win, and they would tie the series at 2 games. If they could do that, the series would then become a best-of-3 scenario, and Vancouver would have home ice advantage. Now, you know what I meant by what a difference Game 4 can make. Wayne Gretzky certainly knows the importance of this game, and he gets into it early on. Early first period, Darryl Sador shot wide. Gretzky there for the rebound. Thought he had it in, but Kurt McLean shut the door on him. No score. Gretzky just cannot believe he was stopped. Canucks do get on the board first in this one. Anatoly Semenov slides it across to Dana Murzyn. Murzyn slides the puck and then slides his body into the net as well. Referee says, yes, indeed, it did count. 1-0 Vancouver. Kings tie the score on the power play. Wayne Gretzky lets the slap shot go from the faceoff circle. It goes off of Robitaille to Thomas Sandstrom, who puts it in. 1-1 after 1. Early second period, the Kings on the power play. Gretzky over to Thomas Sandstrom, who brings it back to Luke Robitaille.
who beats Kurt McLean. Now, McLean gets a piece of it, gets it in his glove, but his glove is behind the goal line, so it's a goal. 2-1 Kings. From then on, it's all Vancouver. Canucks even the score. Jeff Cortnell with the shot. Peter Nedved there for the rebound. Nedved's first playoff goal ties the game at 2, and the Canucks keep on rolling. Dixon Ward, nice pass over to Murray Craven, and Murray Craven will tap it by Kelly Rudy right there. No chance for Rudy. 3-2 Canucks, and they keep on coming. Vancouver goes up by 2 for the first time in the game. Cliff Ronnie with a great effort to get the puck to Gerald Diddick. Back in the net, 4-2. Third period, Canucks go up by 4. Cortnell over to Jim Sandlack. His shot goes off a stick and past Rudy. 6-2 Canucks. They'd had another make the final in this one. 7-2 as they tie the Smythe Division final at 2 games apiece. It was Merzen, Nedved, Craven, Diddick, Cortnell, Sandlack, and Adams for Vancouver. For L.A., it was Sandstrom and Robitaille. Gerald Diddick had 2 assists as well as his goal. Kurt McLean made 29 stops in this game. David Pratt is at Inglewood, California, and has this post-game report.
The Canucks got a lot of things done here tonight at the Great Western Forum. Not only did they soundly beat the Kings 7-2, but most important of all, they were able to send this series back to Vancouver, all tied up at 2 games apiece.
It feels great getting a split out of here. That, you know, we came down here thinking if we can get a split, we can get back in the driver's seat again, and we're happy going back with it now.
It was a very important win for our team, and you know, we were down 2-1, and you know, as I said, that was very important for us to win the game tonight.
I mean, it's a huge win for us. We basically, when we first came here, we wanted to split like they did in Vancouver, but we wanted the first game instead of this one. This put a lot of pressure on us, and we came through.
It was very tough games, but I think we got bigger size. Lots of guys can hit very well from our team, so we got to keep going.
I'm not so sure what the home ice is going to do for one team or another. We've got to go back and prepare to play as hard as we did tonight and hope we get the same sort of result. This is going to be a good series, yeah.
Well, you got to give Vancouver a lot. They played very well. McLean was great when they did break down, and they played very well. They're a great team, one of the elite teams in the NHL, and then tonight, you know, we weren't great, and they beat us.
We were soundly beaten tonight. We were beaten in all areas, and that's pretty much been the story of the whole series. For 2 games, Vancouver has thoroughly beaten us, and for 2 games, we've beaten them in the same manner. And it's really turning out to be a great series. We play, obviously, vastly different styles, and whoever has their system in effect more and plays that way for 60 minutes wins the games.
This series has been very much a roller coaster ride for both teams. But heading back to Vancouver for Game 5, it is the Canucks that have both the momentum and the home ice advantage. David Pratt, TSN, Los Angeles.
Thanks, David. Pat Burns told his Leafs that the winner of game number 4 would go on to win the series. Toronto was trailing 2 games to 1 of their best of 7 Norris Division final with the Blues. He wanted to drive home the point that Lack's play just wasn't going to cut it on his team. And out of how serious he was, quickly dissipated when he scratched Rob Pearson and John Cullen from his starting lineup. While they sat up in the press box and watched, this young bird had a good view from the rafters as well. Leafs got the board just 3 minutes in. Wendell Clark steals the puck in blue zone. Goes to the top corner, beating Curtis Joseph. Gives the Leafs a 1-0 lead. Doug Gilmore continues to be in the thick of things. First, he tangles with the bigger Brendan Shanahan. Then he takes Brett Hull out of the play in the slot. The Blues even things up on the power play. Jeff Brown's shot is tipped. Goes right to Denny Felsner, who has the open net. His second of the playoffs. The Blues get a lucky bounce, and this game is tied at 1 after the first period. Toronto takes the lead in the second. Todd Gill's point shot is stopped, but Dave Andrzejczyk is there, bangs in the rebound. 2-1 Leafs after 2. Third period is packed with great action. Felix Pavan stops Brett Hull from right in close. Then Bob Bassin with the big hit on Mike Eastwood. Great open ice hit. Then Stefan Quintal lays the body on Leaf captain Wendell Clark just outside the blue line, knocks him down. And Pavak comes up with a huge save, stops Nelson Emerson with the pad, then somehow manages to keep the puck out of the net despite the huge crowd in his crease. Now, the next goal is a big one. Todd Gill's shot from the point somehow beats Curtis Joseph. Toronto takes a 3-1 lead. They add an empty netter a little later on. Felix Pavan with a big game as the Leafs tie the series with a 4-1 victory. It's all tied up at 2 apiece. Norris Division final is. Felix Pavan made 27 stops, allowing just 1 goal. This, incidentally, was the first loss by the Blues at home in the playoffs. They're now 3-1 at home.
Views and reviews, the search for hockey glory. It's a winning combination tonight on Real TV, TSA.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, haste certainly does not make ways for Mario and the Penguins. Game 5 of the Smythe Division Final should be a high-scoring affair. You can never go to the Wells once too often if you're the Tigers. In basketball, it's Sean Kemp versus Akeem Olajuwon in the NBA playoffs. And keep your hat on. Time for the plays of the week.
Desk, brought to you by Chevy Truck.
Hi again, everyone, and welcome to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. The next half hour promises to be a busy time. We're going to do our best to cover the happenings of Monday in sport, and there's lots to cover, including the one game in the Stanley Cup playoffs that was in Pittsburgh. The Penguins were playing what was really their most important game of the season Monday night, tied 2-2 in games with the New York Islanders. The Penguins saw the momentum slipping away a little bit as the Islanders won a big one on Saturday. A loss Monday night, and the Pens will be going back to Long Island for Game 6 against a pumped-up Islanders team. Penguins hope in Game 5 to get Mario back in the mix and hoping that he could lead them to a victory. And he got the big ovation, and look, he is pumped up. Look at him. He turns on the juice as he steps on the ice. And they had reason to be confident. 19 seconds into the game, Kevin Stevens out to Mario Lemieux, and he's pumped. How often do you see Mario with that much emotion after a goal? Then, less than a minute later, look at this passing. It looks like a drill. Tockett to Lemieux, to Stevens, to Tockett. Bang, 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 and it's 2-0, less than a minute into the game. 1 minute later, Penguins on the power play. Larry Murphy gets lucky. His shot is tipped from the point, goes over the shoulder of Glenn Healy. 2 minutes into the game, Pittsburgh leads 3-0. Early second period now. The Islanders try to get it back into it. Jeff Norton lets it go from the point. It appeared to go on the net. Carey Fraser, the referee, had to call the video replay people upstairs, and upon review, it was ruled a goal. 3-1 Penguins. A couple minutes later, though, the Pittsburgh Penguins respond. Ron Francis, lovely feed to Mario Lemieux. He redirects from the side of the net. Two goals. Penguins lead 4-1. Later in the second, though, the Islanders strike again. Steve Thomas works his way out front. His shot will be stopped. A couple of people, Hogue and Mullen, swipe at the rebound. It was actually Mullen who put it in. Islanders trail by two. Now to the third. The Penguins shorthanded. Jeff Norton gives the puck away, and Joe Mullen just stops and rips one past Healy right there. 5-2 Penguins. And Al Arbor not happy about that. He tears a strip off power play leader Ray Ferraro after that one. Not a pretty scene. Al Arbor losing his cool on the bench. Things start to get a little chippy after that. And you know things are really chippy when Mario Lemieux gets into a wrestling match. Has to throw Claude Loiselle down to the ice to restrain him. Scotty Bowman a little bit surprised by that. Says, hey, we don't want the franchise player getting into that sort of stuff. The Penguins, though, beat the Islanders 6-3. The final score, Lemieux with a couple of goals and an assist. Tockett, Murphy, Mullen, and Jagr with the singles. Jeff Norton, Brian Mullen, and Travis Green for the Islanders. Good day for Barrasso, who turned aside 34 shots. Mario Lemieux said, yes, the Penguins are in control now, but the Islanders have his respect.
They have a lot of character, that's for sure. They have a lot of young players that have the desire to be successful and win some hockey games, and that's what they proved in the first series against Washington and against us. They've been playing very well, showing a lot of character. Even though they were down a few goals early in the game, they stuck in there and gave us a good game.
Meantime, the Smythe finals have been kind of tough to read, haven't they?
Not against the expansion Florida Marlins. Catch it today on Real TV, TSN.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, can the Great Ones Kings cruise past the Canucks on the coast? The Leafs lay a beating on the Blues in Maple Leaf Gardens. Marquise Grissom doubles the Expos' pleasure and adds to the fun in Montreal. Cats like these, baby, they were born to score runs. And the Cavs and the Bulls collide in round two of the NBA playoffs.
Sports Desk. Brought to you by Gillette Sensor and the new Gillette Series. Gillette, the best a man can get.
welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. You know, when you discuss playoff hockey, the fifth game always seems to be a key. It can be either a clincher in a series, or it can be the game that gives a team a huge lift and puts them in position to clinch the series. Now, both the Norris and the Smythe finals were at that critical Game 5 stage on Tuesday, both series tied at two games apiece. We're going to start with the Smythe Division Final. It's seen some verbal sparring from the two coaches in the last couple of days. Barry Melrose and Pat Quinn both accusing opposing team forwards of taking dives, trying to drop penalties. Quinn actually saying Wayne Gretzky's been getting preferential treatment from the NHL officials. Maybe these two coaches were hoping the tough talk would fire up their teams for this game in Vancouver. As we say, Game 5 is a very big one, big enough that the commissioner, Gary Bettman, was there. And he saw some big hits early, Trevor Linden taking out Tim Waters in the corner. First period, Charlie Huddy, giveaway to Greg Adams. Rudy saves that, but Craven is there to slide the rebound in, and the hometown Canucks have him cheering a 1-0 lead early. A couple minutes later, though, Sandstrom will steal it from Anatoly Semenov behind the net. He tries the wraparound, doesn't go. Gretzky banks it in off Kirk McLean, ties the game at one. Then Luke Robitaille steals behind the net, and he will spot Yari Kurri in the slot. Boom! It is past McLean in a second. 2-1 for the Kings after one. Second period we go now. Right off the faceoff, there's Yari Kurri. Jim Sandlak gets the puck, though. He turns and spots Peter Nedved in front. Nedved redirects the pass. Tips it past Rudy, game tied at two. The Kings forge ahead again. Granato fights for the puck, gives it to Robitaille. He tries to smoke it, but it's just a dribbler, and that fooled McLean, and it's 3-2 for the Kings. Later, more hitting, and some of them are questionable. Watch Alexei Zitnik take out his countryman, Pavel Bure. Yeah. Then Dixon Ward in the corner gets mauled by Alexei Zitnik. The Canucks eventually tie this game up. They have a two-man advantage. And the pass comes in front. It's tipped, actually. Comes to Trevor Linden. That shot misses. He kicks the rebound up to his stick and shovels in the rebound in traffic. The game is tied at three. They go through one overtime, no goal. Second overtime, Robitaille out to the unlikely hero, Gary Tkachuk, and he scores the winner. There's your scoreboard, 4-3 for Los Angeles over Vancouver. The Kings lead the series now 3-2, and they can wrap it up at home in Los Angeles Thursday. As for the Norris Division, the last time the Leafs and Blues scrapped at Maple Leaf Gardens was in that Game 2 double overtime pressure cooker, and we are not just talking about the game, which was a cooker. It was steaming in Maple Leaf Gardens. They don't play hockey this late in the year normally. No air conditioning in that 60-year-old arena. But with the series tied two games apiece, the Leafs were hoping to make things even hotter. They wanted to turn up the heat on that St. Louis goaltender, Curtis Joseph, who has been so outstanding. And they got a pretty good goalie of their own in Felix Potvin as he leads the Leafs out to a big ovation. Bob Berry hoping the Blues can win on the road here. First period action, Leafs on the power play. Gilmore to Borshevsky. He pans on the shot, but Andrechuk is there to get the quick hands on it, turn it around, and make it 1-0 Leafs. Blues on the power play next. Wendell Clark in the box. Jeff Brown centers to Brett Hull. He pops his eighth goal, and the game is deadlocked at one. The Blues complain about the Leafs running Curtis Joseph, but how about Curtis Joseph being run by his own players as Brendan Shanahan knocks Joseph to the ice right there. Leafs on the power play a little later. Borshevsky comes up with his second assist here. He gets it to Rouse. Rouse gets room, lets it go. Screen drive, and it's in. 2-1 Leafs after one period of play in Toronto. Now to the second period. Todd Gill really gives it to Garth Butcher behind the net here, and the Maple Leafs start to surge after that. They go up by two goals. Mike Eastwood's shot goes off the Blues defenseman. Dave Andrechuk knocks it in. Cruising in front. 3-1 for the Maple Leafs. At the other end, Felix Potvin playing well when called upon. Late second period, watch this as he stacks the pads, robbing Nelson Emerson in close. What a save. 4-1 Maple Leafs after two. Third period, Mike Foligno with the great moves here, and he sets up Glenn Anderson for a quick shot. He beats Curtis Joseph. The Maple Leafs up. A little bit later, the Blues try to get under the Leafs skin. Curtis Joseph kind of throws a hit on Mike Eastwood for coming through the crease. A little bit of a melee after that. The Blues are a frustrated team right now, as the Leafs score a 5-1 victory at home and take a 3-2 lead in the series. Andrechuk with a pair. He has 10 goals in 10 games now, tying a Leaf franchise record for most goals in a postseason. Rouse, Anderson, and Borshevsky had the others. Brett Hull with his 8 for St. Louis. TSN's Rod Smith was at the game and filed this report afterwards.
The St. Louis Blues have said they couldn't afford to take costly penalties, and they couldn't afford to rely on their star goalie Curtis Joseph forever. That was especially true tonight when the Leafs took advantage of a shaky Joseph and scored twice on the power play, all the scoring they'd need in the first period.
We're getting a lot of traffic in front of him, and some pucks are going in. And I think everybody gets frustrated when things aren't going well for you. So he still made some great saves, and he's going to be the difference in the next game. He's played well, and we got to keep getting shots on him, and hopefully we can get some more goals.
You know, I could have made some big saves, maybe on the first and the third one. The second one went off a foot, and then it was a lucky bounce, but I'm sure they worked for it. And the fourth one, obviously, unfortunate the circumstance. I lost the puck for about 3 seconds. I didn't see it, and I thought I heard a whistle, so I let up, and that was very embarrassing. But, that's just the way it happens.
They won two in a row, and we won two in a row, so we don't know what happened next game. So they're going to be back stronger, so we can't really take it easy. I know right now it's going good, but we're going to have to keep it going the same way.
Well, we haven't definitely won anything yet. I mean, so that's the main thing. We just put ourselves ahead right now, and lots going to have to do how we're going to play there. I mean, say, nobody likes game sevens. Everybody knows that. Detroit found that out, and we certainly don't want one. We're going to have to be ready.
This isn't over. We still got a lot of fight left in us, and there's no reason why we should roll over now. This is the kind of season where we've had our backs up against the wall in many situations, and this is just another one.
We've got to make sure we hold our feet on the ground and come in with a real good work ethic game six.
It was also another excellent goaltending performance by the Leafs' Felix Potvin, who for the third time in this series held the Blues to just one goal. Unless Curtis Joseph can return to the form he had at the beginning of this series, one goal will not be enough for St. Louis in game six.
The World Motorcycle Grand Prix Championship on Real TV, TSN.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, the Islanders pull no punches at do or die against the champs. The Canucks favored but frustrated and on the brink of elimination. Big Daddy comes back to haunt his former team at the Sky Dome. It's Bonds away in San Francisco, and the Knicks look to avoid getting stung where it hurts on home court.
Desk is brought to you by Makita Canada Incorporated, Canada's leading manufacturer of professional power tools.
Hello, everyone. Welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. Glad you're along. We have a great show planned for you with all the action from the NBA playoffs and a trip around the bases in Major League Baseball. But first, right away, let's get to the lone game in the NHL's postseason. Even before the New York Islanders began the Patrick final against the Pittsburgh Penguins, forecasters were calling for a tough series for the Islanders. Outgunned and outmanned, they said, especially without Pierre Turgeon in the lineup. The Islanders appear to be no match for the mighty Pens. But you know, an Al Arbor team just does not know how to quit, especially when it is one game away from elimination. Game six on Long Island. Let's take you there now. And there is Dr. Arbor. And his Islanders strike early. 25 seconds in, Brad Delgarno grabs a rebound. Quick move to the forehand, and it's in. And it's 1-0 for the Islanders. But the Penguins fight back quickly. Martin Straka collecting his first ever NHL playoff goal. Kind of a two-on-one, and he kind of surprises people by letting it go. Looked like he was going to pass it, and it's a 1-1 tie. Healy thought he was going to pass it, too. Now to the second. The Isles up 2-1. Mario Lemieux carrying in on his off wing. He shifts a little bit toward the slot, lets it go, and beats Glenn Healy. And that is 1 minute and 16 seconds into the second, and it's tied 2-2. Midway through the period, Ron Francis with a high stick right here on Travis Green. That draws a 5-minute major and a game misconduct. On the ensuing power play, the Islanders cash in. Brian Mullen out front for playoff sniper Ray Ferraro, his league-leading 12th playoff goal. 3-2 for the Isles. They have the lead again. And New York harassing Mario Lemieux all night. Darius Kasparaitis with the punch, and well, a bit of a dive by Mario. Yeah, we all agreed, a bit of a dive. Third period, New York up 5-4. Isles in 2-on-1. Ferraro over to Thomas, zing, and it's in. Barrasso had no chance. Thomas made no mistake. 6-4 New York. They go on to win it 7-5 and force a seventh and deciding game. Hey, anything can happen in a seventh game, and Pierre Turgeon could be back. That's what they say. Here are the goal scorers. Straka with two for Pittsburgh. Lemieux, Kevin Stevens with a pair as well. Delgarno, King, Ferraro with his 12th. Brian Mullen, Uwe Krupp, and Steve Thomas with a pair. So it goes to a seventh game Friday in Pittsburgh, and the Islanders say the key here was to get a quick jump.
We knew that maybe they might have a chance to come out on us again in our building, so we thought, hey, let's take the game to them off the bat and let's see how they handle it. And I mean, it's a great hockey team over there, and they did a great job tonight. It's just that, you know, our goaltender played better than theirs, and we got a couple, I'd say we got a couple lucky ones, and we'll take them, and let's get ready for the next game.
Our backs were against the wall. We came out guns a-blaring, and 20 guys all going in the same directions, staying focused for 60 minutes and coming up with a big win for the New York Islanders.
Surprise, surprise. All right, on to baseball now. The Montreal Expos.
The Soccer Supremacy, live from Wembley Stadium in London. Saturday morning, 9:30 Eastern on Real TV, TSA.
Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, the Vancouver Canucks are on the brink, and the Kings hope to achieve their crowning glory. The Maple Leafs are seeing red after being beaten blue in St. Louis. Maybe they'll call this a crude deal. Alberta crew, the Oilers are staying. Dave hopes to stew the Tigers, and Sir Charles hopes to spur the Suns to a win.
Desk, brought to you by Mizuno, the world of sports, manufacturer of quality footwear and sporting equipment, and by Wiser Lock, Canada's first choice in lock security.
Hi everyone, and welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. We have a busy Thursday in sports, and it kept us hopping with Major League Baseball action, the NBA postseason, the Oilers staying in Edmonton, and of course, the story on the ice on Thursday, two huge playoff hockey games, and we will start in Los Angeles. The Vancouver Canucks went into game number 6 of their Smythe final, down 3-2 to the LA Kings, and no doubt a bit troubled over losing that double overtime game at Pacific Coliseum. They played badly, but the Canucks would have to suck it up and play tough if they were going to take the Kings in LA on Thursday and bring it back home for a seventh game. Let's go to the Great Western Forum, where the great one, still the playoff scoring leader, 20 points, hoping to take his team to the next round. First period, Tony Granato spots Rob Blake cruising in. His shot over the shoulder of Kirk McLean. Lovely goal. Kings lead 1-0. Second period, tied at 1. Canucks win the draw. Shot from the point. Jim Sandlak jumps on the rebound, puts it over the shoulder of Rudy. 2-1, Vancouver leads. Kings even the score quickly, though. Alexei Zitnik to Yari Curry. Watch this bullet from the far side. How often have you seen Curry put them in from the wrong wing like that? Game tied at 2. Kings still on the power play. Gretzky to Sidor. His shot is stopped. Robitaille swings at it. Then Sandstrom finds the open net, and LA has the 3-2 lead. Rudy playing well. Lost stick. Bure has him at his mercy, but Rudy with a glove save. Kings up 4-2 after 3-2 and looking for more. Gretzky gives them more. Look at that rocket from the top of the slot. Kings lead 5-2, and they are going on as they defeat the Canucks in 6 games. To win the Smythe Division, Bruce McNall, one happy owner, and that Kings team, one happy team. A 5-3 victory for LA at home. They win the series. Goal scorers, Blake, Curry, Sandstrom, Warren Reichel with his 6th. What a contribution from him in the playoffs. Wayne Gretzky with his 8th. Didick Sandlak and Trevor Linden with the last 3 goals for Vancouver this year. The only other time the Kings made it this far, 1969, their second season in the league, where they lost to St. Louis in the what was then called the semifinals. So this is uncharted territory for the Kings, and TSN's David Pratt has this post-game report.
The Los Angeles Kings are now going to the conference final for the first time in their history. The 26-year wait is finally over, and the man who made the difference is, as you might expect, 99, Wayne Gretzky.
Courage is measured in if you take a hit to make a play, and our guys did it in this series. We played 2 very big hockey clubs. Maybe they seemed bigger because we were a little smaller, I'm not sure, but they played us hard, they played us very physical, and believe me, we're beat up, but we need the extra day's rest here, and we're kind of glad that this series is going 7 games.
Oh, we have a lot of guys in our dressing room, though, with a lot of experience who have been in situations like that, and they realize that when you win one series, like I said, you have to keep your emotions in check, you have to prepare yourself for the next series. You don't want to get too high because there's always a downside. We're going to turn around right now, regain our focus, get disciplined for the next series, and go from there.
Obviously, I think that 2 years in a row we got beat by teams below us, so
That's frustrating, and I think it's definitely not good news for the guys in the room.
We're going into new territory. We have to deliver under expectations, and we didn't do it. We expected to be a club that would advance. Other teams would have something to say about that, and that's what happened with the Kings. They just did a better job than we did.
The Canucks will have all summer to think about what went wrong in this series. As for the Kings, they now must prepare for either Toronto or St. Louis in the conference final. David Pratt, TSN, Los Angeles.
All right, the Kings are in, and will they be playing Toronto or St. Louis? Well, the killer instinct, you either have it or you don't, and the Toronto Maple Leafs were hoping they had it entering Game 6 of the Norris Final Thursday night in St. Louis. One more win against the Blues, and the Leafs would be in the NHL's Final Four as well. But failure to finish off the Blues would mean a Game 7, something the Leafs desperately wanted to avoid. In St. Louis, some people wanted to avoid the tones of the anthem singer. See the earplugs on the kid? Well, Maple Leafs started things off on the right foot. They strike first, they strike early. Andrechuk on the power play. Nobody reacts because they don't know it has trickled in under Curtis Joseph. 1-0 Maple Leafs, 11 goals in the playoffs for Andrechuk. The game is physical at times. Garth Butcher running Wendell Clark into the boards behind the net. Third period, still 1-0 Leafs. Brett Hull will take the drop pass and feather a beautiful pass to Dave Lowry, who just redirects it by Potvin. The game is tied at 1-10 minutes into the third period. Midway through the third, Nelson Emerson takes a shot from the point. Jeff Brown got a stick on it, and Felix Potvin had no chance. That was with about 6 minutes to go. Time running out now in the game. The Leafs peppering Curtis Joseph, but he is there on all counts, and the Leafs run out of time. And St. Louis wins this one by a score of 2-1. So game number 7 will go Saturday in Toronto as they have tied up the series. Lowry and Jeff Brown for St. Louis. Andrechuk with the goal for Toronto. Curtis Joseph great again. 40 saves. Potvin in the Toronto goal. 25 saves. TSN's Rod Smith has this post-game report.
The St. Louis Blues just wanted it more. Ask anybody on either team and they would tell you that. In the third period, with elimination staring them straight in the face, the Blues responded with almost desperate hockey, earning their two goals and earning a trip back to Toronto.
I don't know if they weren't ready, but certainly we came out, we had our backs against the wall, and you can throw 100 cliches out there, but we started the third period down a goal, and if we lose, we're out. Nothing to save it for. We went for it, and we got a big effort from a lot of guys.
The last part of the year, we were just saying, it's been such an up-and-down year. We just wanted to get in the playoffs, and we said if we get there and we look at each other and look at the people we have and the character we have, you know, we could do some damage, and obviously we have, we're going into Toronto playing to win. We're not playing to just show up.
I think we've overcome a lot of adversities this year. I don't think it would have been fitting for us to get knocked out at home in front of people who have supported us so well this year, and I think that was the feeling in the dressing room. It took us 84 games, 59 minutes and 59 seconds to qualify for the playoffs, and we wanted to put ourselves in a position where we could play a seventh game tonight.
They wanted it more than we did. That's all. They beat us to every race, to every puck. We didn't make, I think, 10 decent passes on the stick. We gave them the puck, and that's, you know, a question. I knew it. I could feel it when we left Toronto. I knew it.
They knew they couldn't lose another one. A lot of their really good grinders really came out and worked hard. You know, they did a lot of the cheap stuff, but, in game 6 with nowhere else to go, I guess you can get away with that. So, I mean, I guess the answer for us is game 7. We got to go out and work every bit as hard as they did.
We're keeping right to form by not winning tonight, so we got to go back and try and do it at home in game 7. But certainly it's not the easy way, but we still feel good about our chances in game 7 at home.
The Maple Leafs were looking forward to going back to Toronto.
Patrick, final series against the Stanley Cup champion Pittsburgh Penguins, especially without their leading scorer, Pierre Turgeon, who of course was hit by Dale Hunter and out of it until last night. But last night, it came down to a seventh, and when that happens, anything can happen, as the Islanders added another chapter to their illustrious seventh game and overtime success. After a scoreless first period, the Penguins strike first, Samuelson to Lemieux to Samuelson, all his first goal of the playoffs, and 1-0 Penguins against Glenn Healy, who stopped 19 first period shots. A Penguins giveaway will tie the game. Benoit Hogue shoots wide, but Steve Thomas is there for the rebound. Sixth of the playoffs, it's 1-1 late in the second period. The Islanders lead 3-2 with the Penguins goalie pulled. Larry Murphy's shot deflects twice. Rick Tocchet will get credit for the goal. With 60 seconds remaining, the Penguins erase a two-goal deficit to force overtime. And just over 5 minutes into sudden death, the crowd becomes quiet. The dangerous Ray Ferraro will break out, then passes to David Bullock, who scores the winner. Second of the night. Bullock hadn't scored in the playoffs in 3 years, but now his Islanders celebrate ousting the Penguins. Al Arbor and the Islanders advance to the Stanley Cup semifinals. What an incredible story. The Islanders continue their amazing success in playoff overtime, and they've never lost a series decider against the Penguins, once coming back from a 3-0 deficit. They are 7-0 in deciding.
Their incredible upset of the two-time defending Stanley Cup champion Pittsburgh Penguins. Not a single team that finished the season in first or second in their respective division is still alive. All have been eliminated, as has been the story in most of the other upsets in this year's playoffs. Goaltending was a big part of the Islanders' success as well.
The Penguins fired 19 shots at Glenn Healy in the first period, but the Isles netminder stopped them all and quickly set the tone for Game 7.
Samuelson, save Healy. He covers it up. Great check put on. Back. Francis, save Glenn Healy.
Healy had some help from Lady Luck as well.
For Lemieux breaking, he got it. Short-handed Lemieux at the post.
While Healy was brilliant at one end, Tom Barrasso struggled at the other. Benoit Hogue's deflected shot somehow finds the back of the net, and the Islanders take a commanding 3-1 lead at the 9-minute mark of the third period. But the defending champs battled back in the dying minutes of regulation. Rick Tocchet gets credit for the game-tying goal with a minute to go to force overtime. But just 5 minutes into the extra frame, the Islanders write the final chapter of their Cinderella series.
Here comes Ferraro, 3-on-2. Ferraro drops it for the game.
This team all year has showed character. We got no respect from anybody. We got no respect from the Pittsburgh Penguins. And we're going to the semis and they're going home, and that is wonderful.
We worked hard for this. There's no doubt that we were the team that was the underdog right from the start. And, you know, to achieve this, I think it's a real compliment to the 20 guys that played tonight. And the 25 guys or so that on our team that have just fought all year long at this point to win this game, it's just an amazing feeling.
Last night's game was marred by an injury to Kevin Stevens. The Penguins' all-star left winger required 4.5 hours of surgery today to repair a fractured nose and sinus cavity. Stevens will be in hospital for the next 4 or 5 days, but will definitely recover fully. He also suffered a concussion and a cut above his right eye. Stevens was involved in a collision with the Islanders' Richard Pinault in last night's game. It seemed harmless, but after the hit, it looked like Stevens actually lost consciousness before he ever hit the ice. And because of that, he could not break his own fall, fell face first. He was taken from the ice on a stretcher and taken to hospital immediately for treatment. The Islanders won't have much time to collect their thoughts before starting their Stanley Cup semifinal with the Montreal Canadiens. As a matter of fact, the Isles headed directly from Pittsburgh to Montreal. And the big question when they arrived was whether or not Pierre Turgeon would be ready to play.
First, I know I'm in the lineup and I'll be in, but right now is, you know, just to take care of my shape and try to, you know, have a good practice today and be ready for tomorrow.
They're very, very solid defensively and offensively. They have an outstanding balanced club. They got the skaters, they got the players that are nifty with the puck, and they got the goal scorers and outstanding goaltending and all the way down the line. So. They're a great hockey club, and we have an awful lot of respect for them. We know what we have to do.
The season is mean nothing for me. The games we play against the Islanders, there's lots of things happen during the season that you play two games in two nights, you play the second game in New York, or you play the second game here, and you cannot make any, I think, comparison with the season. Playoffs, it's another season, and right now it's two team plays probably at their best of the season right now.
And game one of the Wales Conference Final goes tomorrow afternoon in Montreal. The Canadiens haven't won a Stanley Cup in 7 years. Now, that may not sound like a long time, but it's their longest drought in 40 years. The last time they went this long without claiming hockey's holy grail was a stretch from 1946 to 1953.
Later, dude.
Coming
Coming up on Sports Desk, for the Leafs, the 15-year drought is over. They're among the final four. The Montreal Expos honor Le Grand Orange, and the heat from the Jays' lighter is snuffed out by the Yankees. The Preakness proves there won't be an American Triple Crown winner this year, and Michael Jordan shows it's not all in the wrist.
And welcome to Sports Desk. We've got an action-packed show for you, lots to cover. But really the big story of the night, Game 7 of the Norris Division Final. It's been 15 long years since the Toronto Maple Leafs last made it to the semifinals. Saturday night, they stood on the brink, Game 7 against the St. Louis Blues. Everyone was cautious going into the game because Game 7 can go either way. But no one was prepared for the way the Leafs totally dominated the Blues and the game. Doug Gilmour came into the game with 19 points in the playoffs, looking to surpass Darryl Sittler's mark of 21. And it put him 1 point ahead early in the first. Leafs on the power play, Todd Gill with a shot from the point. Andrzejczyk flips it past Joseph and made it 1-0 Toronto. Well, the Leafs came out hitting in this one. Wendell Clark levels Garth Butcher. Down he goes. Wendell having a great night. Moves it out from the corner, slides it out in front. Brett Hedekin of the Blues puts it in. A terrible mistake. 2-0 for the Leafs as Ron Curran looks on. Still in the first, the Leafs keep on coming. Glenn Anderson on the wing, slides it across for Mike Kruszelniski, tips it in, and Pat Burns, he was still refusing to smile. He's saying, this isn't over till it's over. Late first period, Leafs get another one. Glenn Anderson sends Wendell Clark in alone, cuts into the slot, slides it by Joseph. Toronto is now leading 4-0. The Leafs really looking like Stanley Cup contenders with their performance on this night. Second period, they keep on coming. Mike Kruszelniski to Kent Mandeville on the wing, slides it in, and it is now 5-0 for Toronto. Curtis Joseph taking a beating in goal, literally. Wendell Clark with a huge blast. He knocked Joseph's helmet right off. Joseph was shaken, but he was okay. Later on in the second period, Doug Gilmour reaches the milestone, moves in, and he makes it 6-0 for the Leafs, and with that, he surpasses Darryl Sittler, his 22nd point of the playoffs, a new Leaf record. Felix Potvin really lost among all the Leafs scoring, but he was good when he was tested. Here comes Brendan Shanahan, and a nice save on him. And Felix Potvin would hold on for the shutout as the Leafs win the Norris Division title. The final score is 6-0. Scoring for Toronto, Dave Andrzejczyk, Wendell Clark with a pair, Mike Kruszelniski, Kent Mandeville, and Doug Gilmour. Gilmour setting the new Leafs record for points in a playoff season with 22, and that breaks Darryl Sittler's old mark, as we told you in the highlight pack. Felix Potvin earning his first playoff shutout. He has been phenomenal through these playoffs. Rod Smith was at the game, and he has this report.
Toronto hockey fans have waited 15 years for their team to get back to this level, so the Leafs tonight did not waste any time. They had their best game of the series without question. The Blues had their worst. It was pretty well over by the midway point of the second period.
Just a great feeling, a great start of, good things to come, and just great to be a part of it. The second time around, I've been through some bad times, and it's fun to be a part of the good times and let the tradition continue.
It would be unrealistic to say that we expected that this could be a possibility. Going into our second year with the new order here, we thought that if we made the playoffs, that would be an appropriate accomplishment. And who knows what happens in the first round. You might be able to pull an upset, but to have this happen, it's just beyond our wildest dreams.
We had the momentum. We scored one early and just wanted to keep going at them hard. And the whole team played very, very well from the goaltender out, and we're just glad we won it.
That's tough to think of anything to be proud of right now after a loss like that. I mean, it's a demoralizing loss. But, I mean, who would have thought we would have been here?
I'm sure in time, so disappointing the way we played tonight. I don't know what went wrong. We just didn't come out a little flat, and we knew the first goal was important, and they get the jump on us again, and just we never recovered.
The seventh game, it doesn't come down to talent anymore. It doesn't come down to tactics anymore. It comes out to who wants it the most and who gets the good bounces, and we happen to get the right bounces at the right time, and we wanted it badly.
So it's bye-bye Blues and hello L.A. Not much rest for the Leafs once again. They'll get set to host the Kings on Monday night for Game 1 of the Campbell Conference Championship. Rod Smith, TSN in Toronto.
Thank you, Rod. Well, there we go. The Leafs advancing to the Campbell Conference Final for the first time since 1978. And as Rod just said, the Leafs and the Kings, game one on Monday. And in the Wales, it'll be Montreal and the New York Islanders. For the first time in NHL history, all four third-place teams have made it to the semis. This is indeed a very unusual year. The Canadiens and Islanders will play game one Sunday afternoon.
Against the Boston Red Sox. Later, take the best seat in the house for Sports Desk. A whole lot more than just the score. Tonight on Real TV, TSN.